you're across it. I don't think you can concentrate on talking and working at the same time. I'm not
walking,
sure you can.
Walking,
yeah,
and eating.
For you, it seems as a
oh,
bit
no,
like.
No, don't say that. Look, he's gutted. No, it, there's a lot of gone wrong here. I say, throw this desk out and get a real one. Seriously.
Well, I think there's a Fisher Price one you can buy in Argos that might be.
Yeah,
worth
but yeah, we got there. But we were stunned because it was second hand, this one. But this is like the Mir space station. I mean, it really is falling apart. Get a new one in. Let's not, you know. Oh, I can't believe it. Get the. I mean, look at the, look at that. Look at the library. Look gap. Look at the gaps in the library.
Let's not go on about this because this isn't good.
What? Whereas that quiz was. Whereas that was good radio.
We can join in and stuff.
But the problem is, Carl, why do you rush to do it? I told you before we should practice these things. That's
although, to be
going.
Fair, Steve, I can't. I haven't got time to do anything, so at least Carl's coming up with stuff.
But I don't mind, you know, running through with it while you're having a kip outside.
Really? What other ideas have you got? Have you got any other ideas, Carl? Because we're really, you've got another hour to put, have you got anything at all?
I've got that feature Educating Ricky, which is a bit of a play on words as well. Right. Do you know the film, Steve?
Educating Rita.
Yeah.
I see what you've done. Go on.
I'm doing that and I teach Ricky stuff.
what do you teach me, Carl?
Well, I've got a few different topics.
Go on.
Do you know like how you taught me about Hitler and Che Guevara and Winston Churchill?
Mm-hmm.
I'm gonna come in with topics every week, and this week I've got
ghosts.
No, hanging bacon is one of the topics.
Say that again?
Hanging bacon.
Hanging bacon.
All the titles.
Francis Bacon.
No, all the titles are sort of named to sort of make, sort of tease you and get you more interested in it.
Hanging bacon? Well, you've certainly intrigued
me. Go on, what's another title one?
Hairy Chinese Kid.
I'm going for that one.
If there was a university degree with that title.
Yeah, no, I'm gonna go for Hairy Chinese Kid,
and
I think.
The final one.
Yeah.
Alien Gives Man a Beard.
Right,
Alien Gives Man a Beard.
I am gonna burst. Right, listen, Carl, you've gotta tell me. Right, let's do it in reverse.
No, we're not gonna do it now anyway.
What do you mean? We've got to do it now. This is the first interesting thing you've said in an hour. Okay, the listeners have just been subjected to rubbish and and mistakes and everything for the last 6 months. Please, we've got to do Alien Gives Man a Beard. What is that? Tell us that.
Right.
Sorry, this is just you telling me something, is it? Well, this feature is you telling me something.
Well, teaching you something. Educating Ricky.
Right. So, are we playing it now? We're already into this feature. Well into this feature, are we?
Yeah, I suppose we are, yeah.
Should there not be a jingle or something?
Yeah, can we have a jingle?
There's no point, because look, I come up with ideas and you dismiss them straight away, so I'm not wasting my time making stuff.
Right.
If you don't
like it. Let's play Educating Ricky.
Right.
Brilliant. Go right. Ding-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling.
Educating Ricky.
Right. What are we going for then? Hanging the bacon. Airy Chinese kid. Alien gives man a beard.
I think Alien Gives Man a Beard.
I'd like to do that.
Right. There's this fellow. I think it happened in America. And he saw a bright light in the sky. And
God, if you're bored.
And he stood there.
This is a true story, is it?
Yeah. He stood there.
Yes, of course it isn't, Steve!
And he saw this bright light and it came closer and closer and it was a UFO, right?
Yep.
And he looked at it and it disappeared, right? And he gets back in his car.
He looks in the mirror.
And he looks in the mirror.
Yep.
He's only got a beard.
He hasn't.
Are you sure it wasn't someone else who got in the car? And he was still standing out there?
No, right.
What?
And it turned out,
yeah.
He got home and said to his wife or his girlfriend, it's a bit weird. So I just got out of the car to look at a bright light, and I got back in the car and I grew a beard, and she said, never mind your beard, where have you been for 3 days? And what had happened is...
He passed out because he was pissed.
No. the UFO had taken him for 3 days,
yeah.
But he'd only thought that he'd only looked at it and it went away.
Yeah.
But what had happened is,
he
took him, and he grew a beard because he hasn't had a shave.
Right, okay. I mean, was Will Smith or Tommy Lee Jones anything to do with this at all? Did you see this on a video, maybe, and thought it was an educational film?
No, it's from a book that some kind person sent in to me. here.
Can I just ask again? I'm just throwing this right back at you. Do you think there's any other possible answer here? Right, a man is absent for 3 days from home.
He's growing a beard.
That's the time that it could take to grow a beard, lest we forget. What if he hadn't actually seen a bright light in the sky?
What if he was lying?
He'd got knocked unconscious. Mm. He'd had a car crash.
Just lying. Yeah, he'd been on a bender, getting pissed for three days.
And that was
his
excuse to his wife.
And they went, Dennis, what are you gonna tell your wife?
Wait a minute.
You're
not gonna believe I was out with you, lads.
Just say you're on your way for a minute. No, Shim, no, I wasn't away from it because of the beard. Oh yeah, look, it looks like you've been out for 3 days. Well, we have, that's
exactly
right. Okay, we've got to cover that then. alien abduction.
Great one.
Okay, let's try that.
Do you see? That's a little scenario there that could have been played.
So, when you say educating Ricky, what have I learnt from this? Never listen to you again. That's all I've learnt so far. Never listen to you.
Yeah, we'll add a little bit more in here, right?
What do you mean, add a little bit more?
We'll add a bit more to this, what I'm educating you about.
Go on.
Right? There's only a law in America that says if you touch a UFO, you're gonna get done. Now, why would they make a rule? I don't know that. Do you know, like, all their rules have a code?
Carl, I genuinely do not know what you're talking about.
Right. Do you know, like, how here.
Do you know?
I have no idea.
Right.
Okay.
Do you know, like, over here?
I'm listening to Capital and these headsets. I got Foxy on for yesterday.
Right, let's bin that.
No way, it's crazy.
I want to hear about Airy Chinese Kid.
Let's play a tune.
Okay,
let's
play a tune.
Come
back with Airy Chinese Kid, definitely.
Some Doors.
Yeah, I just thought I'd go back. Can I take it back to the 60s? This is a tune that a friend of mine sent.
If you touch a UFO, you get done.
Soul Kitchen from the Doors.
Shambles today, this.
David Bowie, Slow Burn, yeah. Quite a Eno trilogy feel about it, lodger and sort of low type. But yeah.
Enjoyable.
Now, okay. That's stressful, isn't it? I think we've got things working now. We've had people coming in and out, just shaking their head, going, shouldn't have bought that desk. But it's all sorted now, I think. And
About 25 minutes for them to come down as well, though. Do you feel like we're maybe quite low in the pecking order in the building?
Definitely.
You know, it's like Capital First, Capital Gold. They can shoot off to other sort of pirate stations.
Yeah.
People's car radios, then they come back here.
Oh, dear. Oh, I had a job at Richard Sounds. Light fitting was buzzing.
Yeah.
Now, but we've got, thanks for staying, listening. Right, okay, educating Ricky. What have we got? Every Chinese Kid, go on.
Right, yeah. This is the, I didn't want to do this.
Really. You didn't want to do it?
Well, I wanted to give you three and I gave you one. It was like the alien man gets a beard or whatever.
Yeah.
And
which was total rubbish, so this one should be better, maybe.
Hairy Chinese Kid. Right, well, yeah. We've talked about hairy people in the past.
True enough.
Haven't we?
Yeah.
You know, the little kids who grew up in woods and hung around with wolves and that.
Yeah, again, you're confusing it. Yeah, they're not, there were some people that were born very hirsute. They were not the people who were brought up with wolves. Yeah. You just put that together in your Homer Simpson type mind.
Right, well, this is like a sort of close to that sort of story.
Yeah.
but the weird thing is, right, Chinese people aren't that hairy as a nation. No, seriously, that's a well known fact.
They don't
have that much body hair and
right.
stuff.
Okay.
So this little kid who was born over there, he was like covered in the stuff.
Was he?
And it was only his nose that wasn't hairy. The rest of his body was caked in hair, right?
Mm.
And his hair sort of
what grew. Sort of hair was it? Was
thick,
it
thick hair?
No, what I mean is, was it sort of like a pony's mane, so he just looked like an Ewok. You know what I mean? Just like hanging down, sort of straight, dark
hair. Looked, in the picture, it looked like it grows from his eyebrow. It grows from his eyebrows quite thick, and then it just goes all the way over.
You
don't
think it was just really long eyebrows that he'd done a comb over?
No, it was all over his body. It had a picture of like his back and that.
Yeah.
And
had he styled it? Had he styled it at all? Did he have it in a quiff or?
No, it was just
hanging everywhere.
All over him.
Yeah.
And and they were like, you know, this is a bit weird, happening in China,
mm.
where we're not normally that airy.
That was the scientist speaking there.
Yeah.
And the local press and that were getting him down, calling him Monkey Boy and all this.
Oh.
And
thinking Chinese press.
But the doctor.
Yeah.
Oh, they're cruel, aren't they? The doctor, it's like those game shows. Well, that's Japanese, isn't it?
Yeah.
That's cool, yeah.
And the doctor said,
I was still talking through all that time where we were just like talking to each other then. Because I turned round and I still saw he was talking. Go
so
on.
Anyway, the local press came in to see the hairy boy, the monkey
yeah,
boy.
And they were like being tight, taking the mickey out of him, and the doctor said
throwing him nuts.
Said he's only hairy. Said he's a healthy young kid. The only faults he's got is he's got a little bit of eczema and a boil. And he said everybody should just treat him the same, and I think he grew up a healthy kid. Yeah, so that's
the end of the story.
That's not a story.
Why?
Well, but I've got nothing. I don't know what to say to that. So someone in China was born slightly hairier than the rest, and he was normal apart from eczema and a boil. That to me isn't a story. But if it is, I've got a million. I mean, it's sort of like bloke from Manchester went a bit bolder than the rest, got a job on radio. He was normal. I mean, that's not a story, is it? Do you know what I mean?
All right, then.
Hang on.
Hang on, he's got the big guns. You're not going to give us hanging bacon, are you?
Yeah.
Come on, then. Right. Come
this
on.
Is the one we've been looking
Come
forward
on.
To. This is it.
No, this is a good one.
This is the one.
And this is a story, right? Do you know the saying, chewing the fat?
Good one. It's one of my favourites.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Do you know what it means?
Talking.
Right. Well, do you know where it came from?
No.
Right, what they used to do years ago. When people didn't have much money.
Is this the same as throwing the baby out of the bathwater?
No, it's not the same saying, but
no, but I mean, is it as wrong as that was?
Well, let me tell you, and we'll
go
see.
On. Okay.
Like, people go out to work, and with the money, they'd buy food.
Oh, yeah, go on. This is a good system. What, go on. What do you mean? People go out to work and with the system-
And if you were quite well off, you might treat your family to some bacon, right? But do you know, like in these days, if people earn a lot of money, they might buy a nice suit or a car.
Yeah. So what are you saying? You're saying wait. Let me get this straight. You're saying that you go out to work and get money to buy things to live, and if you get sort of enough money to live and you've got some left over, you might treat yourself on like a suit or a car or something. Is that
yeah,
what you're?
Yeah. Oh, but back then, if you earned money, they'd say,
"This is olden times."
Yeah.
Okay.
Let's get some bacon in, right? And what they'd do, they'd hang it in the kitchen.
Or to show it off?
To show it off right. To all the neighbours and friends. Because if you had hanging bacon, it was like, he's doing all right for himself.
Yeah.
I love your bacon.
So they had loads of bacon hanging up, and people would come round, right? And whilst they stood in the kitchen talking about whatever they're talking about-
In olden times.
They'd say, do you want a bit of rind? And they'd rip a little bit of rind off, and whilst they're having a chit-chat-
Chewing the
rind.
Well, I think that's probably true. And I haven't heard that, but that one to me sounds true. Do you see the difference between that one and- A man was abducted and grew a beard. Can you see the difference in why I accept that story?
Different stories for different things.
Different stories for different things. So, see, that's a nice story. If it's true, I don't know if it's true. I mean, but it seems totally possible, viable, quite interesting. I won't be quoting that myself until I've verified it. But that's, you know, I won't be telling anyone the bloke got in the car and he had a full-faced beard. Why has his car been towed away?
Because it was a quiet road.
It
wasn't in the way. Okay.
Are you filling in the blanks again? That wasn't in the book, was it, that you read? See, that's the thing. Sometimes I think you make up bits of the story as though they were fact. That doesn't seem right.
Well, that's all you can do, isn't it? So that's educating Ricky, will we?
Brilliant.
Do that next week.
That is brilliant.
No, I think that was good. I enjoyed that. I learned something from that.
I mean, well, I want to get a, I mean, this is all from one book, is it?
Yeah.
That's an interesting book.
I don't want to dwell on it, but with the hairy Chinese kid, what did they say about that? Once there was born a kid who was slightly more hairy than everyone else, but yeah, it's all right. He only had a boil. How did they word it? How did this capture your imagination?
It was a picture that grabbed me, first of all.
Yeah. Sure.
And it was like, God, what's up with him? And that's when I read it.
Did you see the boil in the eczema or just the hair?
No, you see, because his face is like, just under his eyes is sort of nice and smooth, and his nose is sticking out, and that's not hairy. But the rest of him, it looked like he had the sort of a balaclava on or something. And then I read on, and it's like, this is a hairy kid in China.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Okay, good. Anything else in there? Because, I mean, I like
no,
I like
we'll do more of that next week.
How is that alongside, Hanging Bacon? Alien Abduction, a hairy Chinese kid, and, a little interesting fact about the derivation of a phrase.
What do you mean?
He didn't understand a word of that. I knew the word derivation was going to cause problems. I thought derivation shouldn't have come out.
No, I wasn't disputing. He's all smug because he's had a phone call. That was Beck, lost cause. Go on, tell him why you're all smug.
Because Adrian just called up.
Yeah.
After hearing the story about the Chinese kid.
Yeah.
And he said, yeah, that's true. He said that there was a TV program on it.
Yeah.
He had a chromosome defect.
Yeah.
And it made him hairy. And his mum and dad.
De La Soul. Old school.
Brilliant, brilliant.
Old school.
Brilliant.
Germany Saturday.
Brilliant.
Yeah. Good stuff. Carl, so, Educating Ricky. You were going to tease us now with some of the big headlines.
He's
dropped,
looking
there.
Dancing.
He's grooving. He really is
dancing there.
Yeah.
Right. So.
Okay.
The way this works is.
What would you rather be, Carl?
I teach you.
Superheroes.
Three things.
A frog boy. Right. Yeah, that you could leap. You could leap onto a house, but you had to go to frog. You had to go first and leap onto a house. You know, this frog boy. Right, and that could be useful, couldn't it?
That's very useful, yeah.
Right, Amploid, where you've got your hands and microphones, and you can talk into your hand and your whole body. You can, it's like 100 decibels. You can go, oi, come here! And people can hear you from a miles away, Amploid, right? Right? Or Sado, right? And that means that you can go up to anyone and go, all right? And they just, they don't know why, they just get fed up for the whole day.
Which of those would you prefer? Don't answer now, have a think about it, have a think about it.
The frog thing, do I look like one or...?
No, you're just you and your little Ben Sherman shirt and everything. And they go, and people walk along and they go, oh, look at that young child! From on that roof, he's gonna fall. Which frog boy was here? And you go, and you go down, you go, and they go, here's him. And they don't recognize you when you're squatting. They go, well, I don't know who you are.
Mm.
And you leap up there and say, and you come back, and they go, where's frog boy? And you're standing up, and you go, don't know, he went that way.
Yeah, I'd probably have that one.
Would
probably
you?
Go with frog boy?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's pretty good.
Okay, go on.
Right, so, did that just go out?
What?
All that.
Go on, I've got a bad.
Hey, look, Rick, Carl's really planned this show. He's really worked out. He came in early, he was writing things down.
And there's me just coming up with rubbish.
And
like
you're
that.
Just talking rubbish. So, Carl, I know you've been thinking this through. What have you got?
So, Educating Ricky, we did it last week. It's where I teach you some stuff. But rather than just teach you something, I tease you. So, you want to know more. So, you want to take in information. Right? So.
If only people had taught you like that, Carl.
So.
And also, it's the name of a film, nearly. Yeah.
Coming up soon, Henry VIII and his, well, how many wives? Come back tomorrow, Carl, to find out.
The little headlines I've got to sort of tease you with the story.
Yeah, this is gonna hurt me and I'm not very well. Go on.
Right, we've got,
So this is what, sorry, I've just got lost for a minute there.
It's Educating Ricky.
This is Educating Ricky.
Yeah.
And these are the stories that you're, these are the things you're gonna tell him.
Yeah.
But these are just headline versions.
These are headlines,
this is not the actual fact.
Then I think people will remember things.
Okay, alright, so you, sort of bullet points.
Who can forget hairy Chinese boy?
Indeed, I shall never forget that.
Yeah.
So, first headline, don't do that to it, you know it can't live without an head.
I've got no idea. It could be about the French Revolution, it could be about anything.
I know what it is!
You think you do, but,
No, it's something I taught you! Is it the fact that cockroaches can live for 9 days without a head?
That's part of it, but it's something different as well, that's why I thought we'd bring it
up. Okay, brilliant, so that's something to-
Next one, do you won't work it out, if only it was raining.
Brilliant.
Okay. And the last one, what's tomato with you?
What's tomato with you?
Yeah.
Look how pleased he is.
You're obsessed with puns, aren't you, at the moment, Kay?
It just works. I think it works.
Yeah. You love puns.
So, there you go.
So which of those are you going to choose, right?
Oh, well, I'm going to have to choose. Don't do that. You know it can't live without it.
Can we play a tune and we'll come back with that?
Yeah, I can.
Find out what that is.
Yeah.
Wow, what a history lesson that's going to be.
Andy Warhols and Bohemian Like You on XFM 104.9. I'm Ricky Gervais, with me Steve Merchant and Carl Pilkington. Carl. What's the story then?
Right, so what did you say you're going for? You've got your three titles, your three teasers.
Well, I think I'm gonna go for don't do that to it. You know it can't live without an Ed.
I'm looking forward to this.
Right.
So this is educating Ricky, for those who have just tuned in.
Now, something that Ricky told me about when he was educating me was that a cockroach, if you cut its head off, it lives for a week.
Yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm.
And the only reason it dies is because it can't take on water.
Sure. It doesn't have a great time in that week though, does it?
No.
I mean, it doesn't get much done, I don't imagine.
It just needs water, and because it can't find any, like its eyes, it eventually dies. Yeah. Right?
No.
So what-
No, it's not, that's not, it's because it can't drink.
Anyway.
So, with have you heard that one about worms?
Okay.
I have, go on.
If you cut a worm in half, a lot of people have said in the past that it'll turn into two worms.
Right.
But that isn't actually true.
Okay. Who said that?
No, it's a, it used to be like, you know,
kids at school said
it on, kids at school and stuff. So that, you know, a lot of people think that.
Don't pick him up on stuff, Steve, it's bad enough.
Sure.
So, but what they can do, if you get a worm, right, and you find out which end its head's at.
Right.
If you sort of, you've got its head there at the left-hand side, right, and if you sort of cut it in half.
Right.
But not in half. So there's more of its neck than the tail, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The bit that you've cut off will sort of die, and the rest of the worm will get better. So in a way, you can cut it in half, and it'll survive, but only one half will survive.
Okay.
Yeah? What have you learned there?
I wish you hadn't chosen that one.
I know, because it's nothing, is it?
Yeah,
you know that joke,
How do you tell a worm's head from its own? You put it in a bowl of flour and wait till it farts.
Yes.
Right? I told my mate that, right, and he went, what if it coughs?
Yeah. So, it is, there is a bit of truth in that myth of cutting one in half.
Where did you get this information? I don't understand where you get this information
from. That was from the Footian Times. It was like the myth about worms.
Yeah. That was the big article that week.
Did it take you as long to read that article as it took you to tell us just then?
I like the fact that it starts off debunking a myth that we have known of anyway.
Exactly.
You know the big thing about cutting a worm in half and making two worms?
No.
Yeah. What's the other one? What's the other
one? It's not the thing to do either, by the way. Don't go doing it.
No. It's not very nice.
But,
it's cruel.
It can get by.
And it's pointless.
Yeah.
That's no scientific worth.
Yeah.
In that.
Well, there you go.
Okay then.
So the others now, you see what I do. No, I'll tell you the other titles. You're not having them yet. That's the whole idea of this. People will be driving or about to go out doing the shopping. They'll think about that now.
What was the other two?
Well, the other two.
They won't think about that. They've forgotten that.
No, they will.
No, they've forgotten that already.
If only it was raining and what's tomato with you?
Right, I'm looking forward to that one.
No, you've got to tell them tomato with you.
Look what's happening. You see, you already want more education. And this is what listeners will be doing.
I wish you were a teacher. I so wish you were a teacher.
Do you know what I mean? Kids would be saying, I know it's 3:30, but I don't want to go home, I want more.
Yeah.
And that's what I'm doing with you. I'm teaching you.
Why are you teaching me things about not to cut worms in half and what's tomato with you? Please tell me what's tomato with you, Carl.
In a bit.
Rick,
what?
I'd say he's thought the show through. He's teasing the audience. You're excited. They're listening.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah. So listen, I think we should all, because we got your competition to squeeze in. We got all these great goodies. Let's not forget, hello, Children of the Corn.
I do feel slightly guilty that now this is Carl Pilkington's show. I don't think we should have our names involved.
No.
It's not fair, is it? And I think we should give Carl the money.
I don't want my name to this. It's a Ricky Gervais show. Yeah? Right, the quiz.
Yeah.
Will we get that out of the way, because I've only got an hour to start.
Don't you worry about that, Carl. I've already got this one. I'm thinking on your terms now. Let's play a tune. We'll come back with the big competition information. All right? Money Mark. We've got a classic from Money Mark from his album Push the Button. Play that, Carl. And afterwards, are we excited? You got the competition? Look at his face. He's so excited now. He's thought this through.
He's loving it.
Rockbusters.
Rockbusters.
Coldplay. The Scientist on XFM 104.9. Right. Competition, isn't it?
No, it's Educating Ricky Part 2.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
I wasn't even listening. He's doing all the work, I wasn't even listening. Oh, and he spilt some water down that. Right, what's this one again then?
Right,
what's the teaser headline?
Teaser headline is What's tomato with you?
Brilliant.
Yeah.
Brilliant. How excited were you when you came up with that? You couldn't wait to come in and tell us, could you?
I think it's a good one because you won't forget it now, will you? Okay. I mean, like the worm one. What's so special about the worm?
You know, a lot of people think that if you cut a worm in half, it will, two worms will grow, but no. What happens is if you cut the head end slightly nearer the tail than the tail will die, but the worm with the head will be okay. So, it's exploded a myth and that taught me something.
Right, so, the second one, part two of educating Ricky, what's tomato with you?
Yeah.
What this one's about is, ages ago,
scientific.
There's never a date. There's never a country location.
Okay, settle down, children. Now this is A level history. Right.
Once upon a time.
Yeah, yeah. In a when a mental place with swords was a king. Forget his name, but he was a loony. Yeah. So and it was we're literally ages ago. Yeah. So good luck in the exam. Yeah.
Right. So like you know, all right, many years ago.
Oh yes, that, yeah, yeah, yeah. Cleared that up. Go on.
They thought tomatoes were poisonous. Right?
Okay.
Because what
hold on, are they gonna be proved wrong at the end of this story?
Well,
because I don't want to give away the ending, but is it something to do with the are they poisonous tomatoes?
No.
Oh, you're having a laugh.
I don't believe it.
But,
go on,
but
go on.
They could have been eating tomatoes all this time.
Oh, Steve, what's tomato with you anyway?
Okay, so oh, wait a minute.
What's
let's just recap quickly. Recap quickly. Many years ago, yeah. When people thought tomatoes were poisonous.
Yeah. Go on, yeah. yeah.
Well, they didn't know they were poisonous then, because they were still eating them. But what was happening?
Well, they're not.
But they're not poisonous.
Ah, but hang on a minute.
All right. Let's not. I'm just going to listen. I'm
okay,
not even going to
yeah,
talk.
No, okay, I'm not going to tackle.
So, if you remember, years ago they didn't have like pottery plates. They had lead plates. Right.
What are you talking?
Just let him talk.
Sorry, what year is this?
Let him talk.
Come on.
Plates made out of lead. And right. What they'd end up doing, they'd say, right, do you want a tomato? And they'd go, yeah, alright. And they'd put the tomato on the lead plate and cut it. And because of the acid in the tomato, right, it would sort of make the lead runny. And the lead would go into the tomato. And they'd say, oh, it's lovely this. And they'd be eating it. They'd get food poisoning, lead poisoning, what have you. And they'd be really ill. So they thought tomatoes were poisonous, so they didn't eat them for many years.
And when you say they, do you mean the people of Narnia?
Yeah, this didn't happen.
Where was this happening?
Sort of in Britain and that.
You put him on the spot there. Oh, I hope there's no uppity pupils at this school when they go, what do you mean, sir? Oh, if you're gonna oh, I'm fed up with you.
Do you understand?
No.
So the
no, you've got no, right, okay, first of all, Carl, where'd you get this information from?
Where
14
did I get
times
that?
As well?
Do you know
you can't remember.
I don't know where I got that from. I don't know where I got it from. but what I don't why don't you think that makes sense?
But what? Someone once got lead poisoning from a tomato.
Not just one, loads, and then all of a sudden No.
Why is this educating me?
Because I'm telling you that tomatoes.
But I can't take anything away from this. Yeah, I don't know what to take away from this. What have I learned? What have I learned? Don't mix lead with tomatoes. Why is this educational in any shape or form? What are you telling me? A long time ago in the land of Glunk, right, where the ninnies did slib, right, they thought tomatoes were poisonous because they ate plates of lead. What are you talking about?
Yeah, but we all know tomatoes aren't poisonous.
is that what we're taking from the story?
Is that the moral of the story? Don't believe these people that I'd never heard of before. What are you talking about, Carl?
I think it's a bit weird.
It's a bit weird, yeah.
Is these the same people that were spreading those malicious worm rumours?
My hangover's coming back. I've got to get some water. Play a record that was rubbish. Doves. Caught by the River on XFM. 104.9. I'm Ricky Gervais, with me Steve Merchant and Carl Pilkington, doing the button stuff. Actually becoming a little bit of a producer.
Carl,
he's been working, hasn't he? He's come up with a few games, and we made him. He's getting a bit stressed when we shout at him because the mics don't work, or it's hanging off. It was too hot in here. He couldn't get the thing working last week. I mean, I really would throw this studio away and get a real one.
Yeah. Well, I'd get one of those ones you can buy for like tenner from Argos.
Argos, yeah, like Bon Tempe. You, my first studio.
My first
with a little picture
crew.
Of Carl on it. Yeah.
Exactly. That'd be great product placement.
What have you got this week for us, Carl? Because again, we've put very little. I said I would put. I'm not hungover, but I've put nothing into
Rick, have you done any work for this week's
show? No, no.
None whatsoever? No.
Okay,
no,
Carl, what have you got? What have you got? Quick. Keep them. It's five past. They're turning over already. They're finding other things. Melon Sue. There's everything. Well, go on.
We've got after the success of last week, Rockbusters.
Okay.
We're doing that again.
Sorry. Were you on the same show as us?
I thought it went all right last week.
Yeah. Okay.
Right. So we'll be doing that. Got some nice prizes. Which?
What prize? What arbitrary prizes? Films have you got?
Don't tell them yet. Don't.
No. I'll tell you what. If it's Children of the Corn 2, then can I enter this competition?
There you go.
What is that?
He's got some different prizes. Maybe I should just tease the audience with those a bit later, Rick, because there's some exciting stuff there.
It's going to be amazing. Yeah.
Right, so I don't want to give too much away, Rick, but one of them is a copy of The Office on DVD.
Is anything like maybe Burt Reynolds' straight-to-video film? Are any of those in
Sadly,
there?
Sadly, nothing quite as classy.
Fist.
Yeah.
Right. So we've got that lot to give away.
Yeah.
We've got educating Ricky.
Because you taught me that people used to eat tomatoes off lead plates in the land of Narnia last week, which was good. Yeah.
No,
is it only tomatoes they are off the lead plates, by the way? Why didn't they think other fruits and vegetables were poisonous?
No, it wasn't. It was because tomatoes had acid in them. That was the problem. You see, you don't listen, right?
Well, lots of fruits have acid in them.
Yeah, but they didn't eat them back then. they didn't have bloody kiwi fruit and stuff.
Don't
they
say
then.
Bloody. You're a producer. Shit and cock and stuff, you start saying bloody.
Tits.
Play the...
Hang on, right, and...
Go on, play them up.
Keep him hooked, right?
Yeah.
We've still got a song with a story in it.
Yeah. You don't want to play Babushka, do you? He doesn't like the idea of Babushka. I told him that was a story.
Yeah.
And he doesn't like it. A devil went down to Georgia, someone sent in. You know, he's looking for a soul to steal.
Yeah.
Doesn't like it. Won't you like that?
Do you know the song?
Not particularly.
Right, it's a song about a lad who goes into a pub on a normal night. And
it's in sort of the deep south of America, New Orleans, something like that. It's not the old Kent Road.
Right, okay.
Okay, go on.
He goes into a pub, there's a devil in there, he's getting a bit cocky, he's had a bit to drink and he's saying, do you want to sort of gamble your soul away with me and we'll see who's best at playing the violin?
Yeah.
And I think the lad wins in the end, but it's not real enough. Whereas the one-
What? Not like the shadow that got fed up and started pushing kids off bikes?
Rick, I think you're referring to stuff that no one made sense of last week.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
I don't think we should refer to last week.
Okay, let's play Mock Turtles, Can You Dig It? And then we'll come back and we'll talk about that.
I've come to the conclusion, Rick, we should never refer to stuff Carl said in the past because it would just take too long to explain.
Okay, alright, that's fair enough. Oh, Foo Fighters and All My Life on XFM 104.9. I'm Ricky Gervais, with me Stephen Merchant and Carl Pilkington. just before we do educating Ricky, this is where Carl thinks he can give me something of interest and teach me something to take away. Last week I found out that somewhere in a strange land people thought tomatoes were poisonous because they ate them with lead. Things like that. What was the other one you told me?
What else was it last week? Bit of worms. Cut me off.
Yeah. I sent him a text message. I was on the train, a bit bored, and I read in, I think it was Metro, scientists have found out that worms get stressed, and they found out that the fat ones didn't live as long. And when they checked the thin ones that lived longer, they found out they had a gene for de-stressing them. Right? Carl, do you remember what you said?
No.
He went, well, that's stupid, isn't it? He said, did these other ones die of natural causes? I went, yeah, he went, all right. Because it could be that the fat ones couldn't get off the pavement quick enough and got squashed. So maybe the scientists go, yeah, we didn't. Yeah, they come to think of it, they were flat as well as fat.
I think the reason that the worms are getting stressed is because people like Carl are cutting them in half to try and make two snakes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Two worms.
Well, yeah. Well.
That's the concern.
he said they can't even commit suicide if they're stressed by cutting their throat. I also sent him what I thought was quite interesting, that the scientists have found that the elephant hasn't got the best memory. The sea lion has, based on they've got a sea lion and they got it back into the old laboratory 10 years after it taught it a simple trick and it could still do the trick. What did you say to that, Carl?
I'd say they don't get up to much anyway. So if you do teach it something, it is going to remember it.
Sure.
Because it's got nothing else to do.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then it also, I mean, I like sea lions. They look nice and everything, but what do they do?
What was that?
Sea lions? Yeah, what are they here for? It's another jellyfish, as far as I'm concerned. It's like, it's there and people know about them, but what do they do?
Mm. Yeah.
What do we do, Carl? Well, what do we do?
A cat, first, Steve said, is good for your heart. So you
why is it all geared to what's good for us?
Well. Anyway.
Educating Ricky.
Good, we've settled that then. Go on.
The titles that are meant to sort of pull you in.
Yeah.
We've got, what was it? Stocking, Aitken and Waterman.
Yeah.
You've got, it's not his vault. And get a load with this.
Get a load with this. So which pun do I pick first? I think I'll go for get a load of this.
Get a load of this.
Yeah, get a load of this, yeah.
Well that's a story about a girl who she was deaf, right, for 4 years. And it happened quite a bit back this.
What year? Was it quite a bit back?
She was deaf for about 4 years, having an argument with her mum, it said, which I didn't quite understand, because I don't know how they do that.
Yeah.
But she was having an argument, and a man pushed her against the wall, and she banged her head, and her hearing came back.
Okay.
Was she wearing a Walkman, and it fell out, and she'd realised, oh,
There's no explanation.
There's no explanation? Well, why is that teaching me something
then? So I knew you'd say this, right? So I thought, right, I'll stick something on it. Do you know that bees are deaf?
No! No, you can't just- no! If you ask someone something they don't the answer, they don't tell you something else. Just, I'll tell you something else then. I can't answer that, I'll tell you something else. Imagine that, if you asked a teacher. That- how do birds fly? Wow, if you're gonna do that, tallest building is- I mean, what-
Well-
That was the equivalent, Carl, of running away when we asked you a question.
Yeah, the intellectual equivalent of going, look over there, there's a monster.
Yeah, yeah.
Listen, what do you mean? What she. Okay, so. Oh.
So she. Her
hearing
came
back. There's no explanation. There's no explanation. Or you don't know.
Well, there isn't one, is there, really? It's a bit weird.
But the only thing. Did the doctors not look into it?
No, I think they just said, oh, that's good.
Where did this information go? Is that all they put on the net?
There was once a deaf woman who hit her head and she
could hear. Came back.
It was bizarre things about being deaf.
I've got that book, yeah, it's a good book, that.
Was there three more pages you just couldn't be bothered to read off?
Yeah.
No, no, it was just a little bit and it
Was there a little picture, a cartoon picture?
No pictures, I just read
it. Ow.
Look,
ow,
if you don't want to know, if you don't want to learn, you know.
Yeah. Okay, okay, it's not his vault. Let me have it's not his vault. You've got to save this. This has got to teach me something. It'll be an interesting story.
Right, it's not his vault. This fella,
yeah. What year? Ages ago? Olden times?
I'd say in the 70s.
Okay.
Would you? Any evidence for that?
And,
Does he wear flares in the, in the story?
Right,
is that your reason?
No, it's a bit like Yuri Geller, this fella, right? Where, he's electric.
He's electric.
And, if he walks past the telly would fizz.
Uh-huh.
If he walked past the radio, it all goes like that.
Ooh.
His hair stuck up all the time.
Ugh.
And he'd be having a bath and everything would be alright and then the power would sort of switch on in his body and the electric in his body made him jump out of the bath. So.
What do you mean so? What is that so? What does that so mean? You've given us nothing. You've given us nothing.
You'd have to at least give us the scientific explanation.
Yeah.
Electric eels have 400 volts in them.
Oh, is this the running away again?
What was that one called?
Yeah, but
it's not his vault.
But there's a reason it's not his vault. I thought it was going to be something about
I think we should do these the other way around.
It's
I think
not
you should tell
vault.
Us the story and then we'll hear the pun.
It's not his fault. It's not his fault.
Right, let's leave it.
Play it. Educating Ricky.
We're not doing it.
No, we are. Oh.
What? Don't look at me like that.
Oh, Carl, are you in a bad mood?
Carl, I'm dreaming of you.
Right, do the last one. Do the last one. Carl's saying we're never doing this again because we don't appreciate it. Yeah, Carl, you don't know how good this feature is, mate.
Right, last one.
Yeah.
Stocking, Aitken and Waterman.
Go on then, tell me about that one. What's that? What am I going to learn from this?
Right, well, do you know the saying, pot a sock in it?
I like it already.
Do you know the saying?
Yeah.
Right, well, do you know where it comes from?
I assume it's shut up, so I'll stuff your mouth with a sock to shut you up.
Years ago.
Yeah. Sorry, am I right?
No, not really. Ages ago.
1970s?
50s, okay. I'd say. Do you know the old,
I'd say!
Do you know the old gramophone?
Yeah.
With the big horn on it?
Yep. Yeah.
Right, well, those stereos didn't have a volume control on them. Right? So they'd be listening
to the
album.
Oh, so you put a sock in the
And you'd put, mute. You'd put something like a sock.
That's a real one, you see. That's taught me something. That's good. That's excellent, Carl. That is the only one that counts, like chewing the fat, if they're true. I'm assuming they are. It works. It's of interest. I haven't got it verified yet, but that is educating Ricky. That's brilliant. I will say the other two were more entertaining. So, you know,
I don't see, do you understand the distinction though between that one and Electrical Man?
And or I've hit me head, I can hear you, mum.
Yeah. Can you see the difference though? Or
Not really, because when I read all three, I took something away from all of them.
What did you take away from the Electrical Man?
I just thought, oh, imagine that. Imagine how annoying that would be.
But that's not education, is
it? And it's not taking anything away.
Think about it, right? We take our lives for granted all the time, don't you? You get up in the morning, it's like, oh, I'll get up and walk for a shower. Some people can't walk, right?
Yeah, yeah.
This guy, you can't even have a bath. You know, I mean, it's nice to have a bath, isn't it, when you've got time on your hands and you can relax. This guy can't even do that. It might be alright for a bit, but he's not really enjoying it because at any moment it could strike.
Yeah.
So he can't even do that. He can't comb his hair because it keeps going a mess.
Yeah.
He can't watch his
Knocking you.
Does he fight crime? What does he do with his powers?
Yeah.
I think he just has to sit around because no one, he can't work with machinery.
Right.
Because he'll probably blow a fuse.
Yeah, so he just sits around.
Think about it. What can he do?
Mm.
What normal things can he do?
Skateboarding.
Going for long walks.
Yeah.
Put a wetsuit on.
Well, he can't do that.
Why?
Ooh, water and electric.
No, no, wetsuits aren't actually wet. They're dry initially.
Just put a whole wetsuit on and walk round with flippers and
a wetsuit's not like a dinner jacket that's like really wet.
All I'm saying is think, do you know what I mean?
Oh, okay.
And what was the girl
deaf, 4 years hits her head.
Yeah. That's just,
what have you learned from there?
What is that?
Well, imagine how happy you'd be. Remember that time when I, I nearly died when I choked on a Mr. Freeze pop?
Right, no, tell us that one again.
No, I told you, didn't I?
Tell us again.
Yeah, but the people will remember it and then it's
They weren't listening. Go on. What happened?
It was ages ago when my mum and dad used to go out shopping on a Friday.
1970s?
Get the food in. get a week's load of food in the cupboard and that. And we'd, you know, they'd come in with all the food and we'd all be like, oh God, you know, there's no food left on a Thursday really. So we'd all be hungry on the Friday by the time the food got in.
Mm. I love that, and that they wouldn't eat it. I imagined him like jackal puppies.
Yeah.
Just like licking your parents' mouth for food as they come through the door.
So they come in from the supermarket, they're emptying the box. Our kid had got some biscuits and what have you.
just a feeding frenzy, like pigeons.
I grabbed the Mr. Freeze pop and knocked it back really quick, but it wasn't frozen. So I knocked it back so it was like a liquid and it went down the wrong way, right, and I was choking, right, and I nearly died. It must have been about, how long can you go before you die?
A couple of minutes to do
it. I reckon about a minute 50. Right, I was really close to dying.
How do you know you were close to dying? Did your life flash before you?
No, but I just was like,
there's loads of instances of him eating pops.
Yeah, exactly.
I just 40 of those.
Whatever, right?
What do you think you'd see if your life flashed past you? What do you think, which elements would stand out for you, do you think?
Start now, go back. What do you remember? What's the first thing you remember?
As a kid.
Yeah, yeah. Just anything now.
Being in the hall and having our dog licking my face.
That's your earliest memory?
Yeah.
Okay, what's the next one?
Right, next one's probably being at primary school with Lindsay.
Yeah.
Was that your girlfriend?
Well, a little friend who was a girl.
Sure.
Yeah. And we used to have like tins with letters in and you'd have to write stuff. But anyway, what are we doing? Right, so anyway.
I'm intrigued by the dog that was licking your face.
Well, bin that.
We won't bin that.
No, it's a great feature. I just think you need to be a little bit more careful about what you consider to be education.
I fell over. All right,
well, right.
We'll work on it next week. Play a tune and what have you got for us? Because we've got a big competition.
Come on. We've only got 25.
Yeah, well, come on,
don't worry about
then.
It, Carl. Play a tune. We'll come back with Rockbusters.
What are we playing?
Let's play a bit of
Death in Vegas. Scorpio Rising.
Featuring the voice of, is it Noel Gallagher?
Liam, innit?
Is it Liam?
Sounded a bit like him.
Liam, yeah.
Yeah. Excellent. Yeah. Right. Okay. Let's get this show well and truly on the road. We better start educating Ricky next, Carl. What have you got for me? I can't wait for learning. I need learning. I need education.
We should just explain something. Obviously, for those that have just tuned in, Carl tries to teach Ricky three things each week.
Based on the pun title.
And yeah, each of them, just to tantalise Ricky, is abbreviated into some kind of headline.
A cryptic clue involving a pun.
So what have you got for us this week?
They are really cryptic this week.
Okay.
Yeah.
First story, little headline. Is don't worry about him. He candle it.
He candle it.
Yeah.
Sounds a bit like he can handle it, but it's not. Brilliant.
Second one.
I'll get a lobe of this.
I'm
get a lobe of this.
It's a classic.
Who can forget? Get a lobe of this.
Yeah. Coming soon.
And Stocking Aitken Waterman.
Go on.
Second one. Yeah. I'm committed to this treatment.
Mm. I'm committed to this treatment.
Yeah.
All right, tantalizing.
Yeah. And the last one, the police are causing a bit of a stare.
Oh.
The way he looks when he says it. Oh, I wish we could see. Can't we get Carl on telly? Nope.
There's got to be a way.
With all the cable channels, anyone can get on telly these days. Let's phone up. Let's get you on Choice or something. Just Carl.
What are you going for?
Oh, he can handle it. I think.
Don't worry about him. He candle it.
He candle it. Okay. Let's hear this one.
Right. Are you familiar with the phrase burning the candle at both ends?
Yeah.
Do you know how it's come about?
I know a man who does.
I assumed that it was to get more light in the room.
How would that work?
Well, they'd put it sideways and light both wicks, so out of one candle they could get two. No. Go on.
No. What it is.
I know it means you're staying, you're doing too much, you're staying up too much, you're not getting enough sleep, and you're-
Well, years ago.
Yeah.
When they didn't have light bulbs and that.
Oh yeah, what year is this? Literally ages ago, specifically.
Yeah, quite a bit back.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Didn't have light bulbs and that, so they used to have candles
when did the light bulb come in? Because I can't remember at the moment.
I don't know.
Okay, go on.
So, yeah, so they've got a light bulb.
You wouldn't know. You're a doctor. You're not a historian. Go on.
And people who worked a lot of hours. Yeah.
How many? Literally lots.
They get up early in the morning because they have to be up early.
Yeah.
And it's dark outside, so they'd light the candle.
Sure.
And they'd wear it out a bit, and then they'd be getting in late as well.
Yeah.
And like they'd be like, oh, it's dark. I'll have to light the candle again, and the burning candle at both ends of the day. So that's where the saying comes from: burning the candle at both ends. So,
all right.
That's a little lesson.
Yeah.
Lesson one.
Okay. can I have?
No, well, no. You can't have.
You can't
one
rush
yet.
Into them, Rick. You've got to.
I've got to soak
you've
in
got,
that.
You've got to soak that one in. Any questions for Carl off the back of that?
What do you think?
So people were. I mean, basically, where this comes from is people were.
They're literally burning the candle at the end of the day.
Sure.
There you go. So we've still got.
Go on.
I'm committed to this treatment, and
I can't wait. This is like Christmas Eve for me. It's like Christmas. I've got to open another present now.
No, I'm afraid we've got to save it. Rick, listen. We often get a lot of email correspondence during the show, Rick, which I don't sort of pass on to you because I mean you're busy, you're planning the show and stuff. You've got a lot of ideas. You've got music and stuff to worry about. So I check the emails, and we get a lot of response. A lot of people that obviously you know want to give us feedback. Just a sample one from Richard Anderson. He's just emailed us in here, Rick, because he's been listening to the show. He says, Ricky, your show is appalling. Are you actually aware you're on the radio, or has someone just secretly stuck a microphone on you? That's from Richard Anderson. So that's typical of the kind of feedback, Rick, we're getting today. So,
it's that good, is it?
So that's the kind of, high positive praise that we're getting. So
I'm glad Anderson's listening, because I wanted him. I was gunning for him as a fan.
I was worried that
early on in our career. So I think he's hooked now, though.
But thanks, Anders, for getting in touch. Good work.
He's sitting through it for Hellraiser, though, isn't he?
Yeah. Well, that's still to come.
Still to come. Still to come. What are we playing?
A bit of old dirty bird. I can't say the word. It's offensive. Old
is it ODB. Bollocks? Is it old dirty bollocks?
No.
What is it?
Old dirty
big cock?
What is it?
I can't
tell you.
Nirvana.
Amazing.
We're just talking, we're getting excited about that.
Yeah, got an incredible voice, yes.
And Grohl, drumming, it's brilliant. You know you're right, the new one from Nirvana. Well, it's time for Educating Ricky part two, isn't it? I'm excited, Carl. I'm gonna learn so much from this. What's the choices again? What's
right, you've got left.
Still keep phoning your answers to
email.
Email, sorry, yeah.
The answers to Rockbusters.
Yeah. Right, okay, Educating Ricky, part two.
Right. I'm committed to this treatment.
Yeah.
Is one.
Oh, I've got to go for that one.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Or the other one is the police are causing a bit of a stare.
He still says it like it's the best thing he's ever come up with, which
it
is.
It could be. Right, go on then. I'm committed to this treatment.
Right. Do you know the saying?
Is it just sayings now? Are they all sayings this week?
No, 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 they're not. Okay. No, the other one isn't. Frog in your throat?
The saying, there's a frog in your throat?
Yeah.
I assume it's, when you, croak a little bit, you sound like a, frog.
No, no. Right, that might seem a bit weird, this one, right? But years ago.
Oh, yeah.
Sorry, what is that clue, committed to this treatment?
It's about frogs committed.
It probably works better with a K and an ER written down.
Well, also, if you'd pronounced it Kermitted,
yeah,
but not committed.
Kermitted to this treatment. Right, go on then.
That's
right,
genius.
So yeah.
Well, what?
You go to the doctors and you go, my throat's hurting a bit.
Right.
And what they did ages ago.
Ages ago? What year was this approximately?
We are going back quite a bit with this
oh,
one.
Oh, okay. Go on.
And the doctor would say,
he got encrypted history. Imagine years ago. Go on.
And the doctor would say, right, keep your mouth open. I need to look at your tonsils. And the jaw would ache a bit because they weren't as quick back then because they didn't have the technology and stuff. And they'd have to, like, stare at it and study it and stuff. Mm. And, like, they get an achy jaw, right?
Keeping their mouth open.
Yeah. Like, you get, you know, you eat a Mars bar or whatever, it's a bit So, they'd sat there, and they used to always close the mouth, and it used to annoy the doctor, right?
Sure.
So what they did, they used to get a toad.
Right.
And put it in the mouth.
Rubbish.
Okay, keep talking.
And, that way, they couldn't close the mouth because either they'd squash it.
Right.
Or, apparently, you're not allowed to, lick a toad's back.
So the doctor would have them for breaking the law?
No, 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 but it's poisonous, right, a toad's back. You should never lick a toad's back.
Or put it in your mouth, really.
Just stop for a second.
Wait.
Can I just ask one question?
Go on, ask one question. I've got a few, but go on.
Sure. My initial thought is, it sounds like a brilliant bit of sort of medical, knowledge there. It's a great idea.
Yeah.
My only thought is, how does the doctor see past the toad?
Yeah.
Your tonsils?
What's he actually looking at with the mouth open? Surely the toad is
in
the way.
Isn't it hopping around in the way?
It didn't say.
No. Sorry, and my first question is, was this on the internet?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Carl, that is bollocks. That is, I mean,
Well, alright then. Let's turn this round. Where does the saying, you got a frog in your throat come from?
Probably because you sound a bit croaky. Probably that. Probably because you sound a little bit like a frog when you've got a sore throat.
Carl, did you not question it just for a moment when you read it? Just for a second, didn't you think, that seems an odd approach? Firstly, why a frog of all the different
because
species?
Because it's poisonous. A toad.
So a toad, so it's a toad as well?
Yeah, well, that it worked. I'm committed. Worked.
No,
I was going to change it to, have you heard the news, Toad Day? But I went with the frog.
Right, so that's rubbish. Next, can I have,
let's play a tune, let's come up with the last one.
Oh.
Oh, can I just say- No, just play it.
Yeah?
Yo, Carl. Why are you telling me this? I mean, thank you, because it's, you know, killed a couple of minutes, but why is this educating me? What are you telling me
because
here?
Because there's a bit of a thing there, a bit of a fable, that don't always judge a book by its cover. Yeah? So, the guy, he hadn't even had a drink. He'd probably just been shopping.
Yeah.
Walking down the street, and everyone's, like, getting involved. Like, what's he doing?
Hang on, I don't understand. He's walking down the street, happens to have a glass eye. He was doing nothing else to suggest he was drunk. You don't pick people up just because their eye looks like that.
But even if it happened, why are you telling me? With no particular detail. Oh. I know this, but then we're gonna get
to people- It's not enough information!
I know, yeah.
No, there's a bit of a lesson there, educating Ricky. Just, you know, just watch what you say. Don't always jump to conclusions.
The only education I can take from that is that, if I ever do become a policeman, I shouldn't just arrest people because they look a bit drunk. I should just tap their eye with a pen and go, on you go, yeah.
Guys, can I just stop you there? I'm just gonna email Richard Anderson and tell him I agree.
Right, listen, running out of time and that.
Where did the phrase frog in the throat come from?
We've got it here.
It's been told. Well, there's three. Can we play a tune and come back with that? Have we got anything lined up?
Yeah, we've got the song with a story in it.
Come on, Carl, let's do something. Quick, play a record.
Song with a story in it.
But never mind that. They're listening. We discussed this off air. Come on. Play a record.
Right, it's Kinks. It's a song with a good story in it. You got to listen to the words.
Carl, what was that? That was your little song with a story.
That's another little feature that we do every Saturday.
Make sure you tune in.
It's a song that's got a good story in it. There's a lot of music about these
days. What's that story about then?
You don't know what they're going on about. Whereas that classic from the Kinks called Lola.
Yeah, what's it about?
I'd listened to it for the first time properly this morning.
Yeah.
And what I've worked out from it is a fella who goes out for a normal Saturday night out. He's in Soho.
Yeah.
He's having a Coca-Cola or whatever. And he sees this woman. He thinks, yeah, she's all right. Yeah. Wouldn't mind a bit of that. So he wanders over and he sort of gets talking to her. He looks at her and she's got a great figure, nice face and all that.
Lovely knob.
And she speaks and he goes, oh God. Got a bit of a bloke's
frog
voice.
Throat, yeah.
Not a bit of a voice like a bloke. But he thought, but you know, that's her only down point.
Sure.
So yeah. he dances around with her and I think he sits on his knee, I think he said.
Yeah.
Anyway, it turns out it's a fella.
Yeah.
Right. So, a sobering lesson.
Yeah.
What do you take from that?
Look away sort of if you think you might be talking to a bloke, just look at it his sort of Adam's apple. Okay. And he'll probably have a hairier arse than a woman.
Yeah, I think you've gone too far away then, though. I think you're already getting too close.
It's a bit late to pull out.
No, pun intended, definitely.
There was a pun intended.
Oh, was it? Alright, was it?
Yes.
Alright, okay, well don't be disgusting then. Right, okay, right, the results of,
We ain't got a winner for the first time.
Yes, we have,
we've got loads of winners.
No, we haven't. We've done this feature for 3 weeks. This is the first time I've managed to sort of.
Well, let's go through them then.
What have they got wrong?
The first one.
Let's do them in reverse order for a second. Okay. So what's the last one?
The last one. The clue was that bloke does sport on the telly and he's got a little kid.
What's that?
That's Destiny's Child. Bez, who does ITV Sport,
has
got
terrible,
a tiny child, right? No, that's fine, yeah, they got that.
Destiny's Child. What's the middle one?
Right, the middle one. The second one was, he doesn't like women, yet he's got a couple of kids, that's a bit weird.
Yeah.
Right? That was PD, that was Puff Daddy.
That is offensive. Go on.
But it's not Puff Daddy, it's Puff Daddy. And he's not even called that anymore, he's called P Diddy.
Well.
Okay, fair enough.
But they got that one.
Yeah.
And if I'm being tight, these lot are as well.
Yeah.
Yeah. Tight means something in Manchester. Go on.
Right. And the first one that they're having problems with, I don't think them birds should be allowed in this
area.
They've
got it. Boyzone.
It's not Boyzone.
What's the clue again?
I don't think them birds should be allowed in this area.
That is perfect. A Boyzone. No birds.
No women.
No women, yeah, birds, right? A boy zone. Sorry, Carl. If that isn't the answer, their clue is better than yours. That is brilliant. What was yours? Boy zone, it works perfectly.
What's your answer then?
Bangles.
What? I have no idea what that means.
Like seagulls. So you don't want them in this area, so you're banning them. Bangles.
Well, give it to Boyzone, because Boyzone's better.
Don't
be as loud as Harry, it's a Boyzone.
I think we should have a rollover. Carl beat them. Carl beat them. You have to use his logic, surely.
But theirs works. You can't do what am I thinking. No, that's not what I'm thinking. It perfectly. It works perfectly. I think you've got to give it to the ones that got the Boyzone.
Well, how about, right, because they didn't actually get into my head.
Heaven forbid.
How about we just keep back the David Attenborough, and they can have, I'll chuck in the Hellraiser. Right.
Okay.
Most of you.
And Blondie album and the Madness
one. Yeah. Okay. Pick a winner at random.
Pick a winner, Steve.
I'm going to give it to Paul Sloman, who got those answers, and he also says, "P.S. Carl, you're a moron." So
brilliant.
Giving that to Paul, and good luck to him.
Right, well,
he's got a crazy night tonight. If we can rush these over to him, he's got a cracking Saturday night.
Well, if I'm a moron, I might get your address wrong when I send them to you.
Ooh.
Oh,
coming right back at you, Paul.
Yes. Come on. Right.
John, play a song.
Is this oh, your car's annoyed because they didn't get wild. Band goals.
A song from song for the ladies. I think we seem to have missed this a lot of weeks, but this sure. is. I've been wanting to play
it's
this.
Not
for
like
ages.
Us to forget things that happen.
This is a band at Frente who kind of came and went, and oh, no yeah. one was particularly interested. But they did this lovely acoustic version of the New Order tune, Bizarre Love Triangle, oh, right. and this just shows you how incredible the melodies and the words and everything are.
Brilliant. I'm
New Order. Just play this.
Good night. Bye bye.
Is this
bye.
In the week?
Do you reckon Richard Anderson will be back next week?
Yeah, Richard Anderson will not miss this show.
Excellent.
Every time I think of you, I get a shot right.
Missy Elliott, Work It on XFM 104.9, Ricky Gervais, Steve Merchant, Carl Pilkington.
Educating Ricky?
Yeah.
Do you want to do a bit of that?
Well, the clues are coming in furious.
The answers, I should say. Yeah.
Yeah. So go on in. Oh, this is what.
Yeah, Rockbusters is well underway, Carl. Don't worry, you've done your work there.
Okay.
Right, come on.
Right, educating Ricky.
This is my favourite bit now.
You're just gonna tease us, aren't you, with three, headlines, if you
And I'll choose one, then we got the other two as well.
Yeah, that's the way it works, and at the end of it, you learn some stuff. Like I say, I'm struggling a bit with knowledge.
Yeah.
At last he confesses.
Yeah, go on.
So the three headlines for you to pick from, we've got, first one, we'll have a big fire tomorrow.
I got a feeling there's some vegetables involved.
Go on.
Maybe. Second one, he's a bit of a nuisance.
Okay.
Right. And third one, I'll bacon in the morning if you're sick of having me here.
Oh, that one.
I'll bacon in the morning if you're sick of having me
right,
here.
Right, I'm having that one.
That's brilliant.
Right, well, it's a saying. Do you know, cold shoulder? Giving someone the cold shoulder?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Alright, if you have someone around at your house and, you know, you try to get rid of them and they're hanging around and stuff and you're like, oh, I wish they'd go, I'm tired and that. Well, years ago,
when? Literally years ago. Well, ages ago.
Sort of,
olden times.
I think it said medieval times.
Yonks ago then, yonks ago.
Yeah, medieval, yeah.
We're going back quite a bit on this
Well, one. You know when you find out these books, why don't you just pop down when it was?
Just make a note.
I don't think it says all the time, it just sort of says, you know, a few years back.
Yeah.
Oh, no, it doesn't.
Well,
never.
All right, I'll make an effort next week.
Okay.
Right? So, oh, it's annoying that, because my girlfriend said to me, just make a note of the time, they'll stop having a go at you.
Yeah.
Yeah?
And I kind of thought, oh, it's all right.
Didn't listen.
I don't think it matters anyway in this one, we're looking at the saying, right? So it's giving someone a cold shoulder, right? And what it is, right, ages ago, there wasn't enough houses for people.
Right.
Because there wasn't much money being made, you know, there weren't big businesses, people weren't earning good money like they are now. So, there wasn't as many houses, right? So what you ended up getting is like, you know, the rich people having a nice place to live.
Oh.
And the poor people were like wandering about, you know, looking for places to live and that. And what they ended up doing is, they had like, people would go around to the mate's house and say, look, I haven't got anywhere to live, it's a bit cold, can you let me stay, right? So they'd go, oh, all right, then you can stay a couple of days. But they ended up staying for, like, weeks.
Yeah.
Right? So, to sort of get rid of them, what they'd end up doing, they'd be making the dinner, and they'd, be making a lovely dinner, like, a bit of meat, nice warm meat, and, nice veg, gravy, and,
this happened every time, did it?
It works.
No, this is where the saying came
from. This is what happened, Rick.
This happened every time.
It was in that vague book.
Right. The book of vague sayings and stuff.
Right, so they'd be making a nice meal, but what they did, they looked after all the family, but the person who won't go home, they just give them some, like, sort of a cut-off of cold meat.
Right.
So they'd say, you're giving them the cold shoulder, meaning...
Right. Okay, that's rubbish. Absolute.
Carl, why does that necessarily work?
Yeah. Why do they always, in every situation when you want to get rid of a lodger, well, still feed him every day, but make the meat lukewarm.
So he leave then.
Yeah.
Oh, this food's lukewarm. I'm gonna go, I'm gonna become homeless
and
again,
they go,
wandering the streets.
Hold on, are you giving me the cold shoulder? Yes. Do you want me to leave? Yes, just say leaving. No, I like to do it cryptically. That way, in years to come, someone will have a little saying about it.
Well, anyway, that was our bacon in the morning.
Yeah.
If you've had enough of meat, we'll leave that.
Well,
bacon in the morning! Oh,
bake on in the morning if you've had enough of me.
So come back. What are the others? Just tease us again with the others. We'll come back to those.
You've got. He's a bit of a nuisance. And,
brilliant.
And we'll have a big fire tomorrow.
Nice. Looking forward to that.
Okay.
Electric Six, Danger, High Voltage on XFM 104.9. Sums up this show. Danger, High Voltage.
Indeed.
Ricky Gervais with me, Steve Merchant, and the amazing Carl Pilkington. So, other things you don't see, Carl. Got any other ones, or you obviously been thinking about this? What confuses you when you look out your window? What confuses you with the world? What do you walk around going, oh, that's a bit weird? I remember when you were in Edinburgh, you were confused because you saw someone putting a parking ticket on some rubbish. Which confused you.
Yeah. That was weird.
Yeah.
The world's a crazy place, isn't it? I mean, whatever you look at, you can, do you know what I mean?
Like what?
Oh, anything. I mean, you could look out the window there and you'll see something, you go, why are they doing that?
Yeah.
What are they doing that for?
Yeah.
I'll tell you this, maybe we should bring back White Van Carl. There's some interesting questions this week, Rick.
Yeah.
So we could pull that out of the bag if you're interested.
Shall we do that?
Just get Carl's take on the world's
Let's do it.
I'll tell you what, we'll do that in a second. Let's have another Educating Ricky, because I think you got sidetracked with your talk of
Well, just the other thing on things you don't see. Look at the way when I went to school, there was two kids with them big heads. Now, you don't never see them.
Sure. Yeah, but no one else saw them anyway, Carl. It's only you that saw two of them, not related, and wouldn't hang around with each other because you think they thought it would be too obvious. webbed fingers and big heads. That's amazing.
And there was a kid with a pigeon chest. So.
Oh yeah, and the lady with the head like a bag of spuds.
Let's not go through these again. It just raises too many questions that can't be answered.
Yeah.
Right then, so we've got we'll have a big fire tomorrow.
Yeah, go on.
Is that the one you want?
Let's go for it.
Right, I think this was like round the 1700s.
Bluffing.
And
just bluffing.
Who was
the king then?
Don't know.
Go on.
But it's about the word bonfire, right?
Bonfire.
Bonfire.
Yeah.
Do you know where it comes from?
No, go on.
No.
Right, what happened is it's got nothing to do with Guy Fawkes and that, which is what I thought when I saw it. It's got nothing to do with that. But ages ago, at 1700s, right, they didn't have enough houses, like I mentioned.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, if that happens, you get people living on the streets, you get diseases, people aren't cleaning properly, so you get more deaths.
Mm-hmm.
All right?
Yeah.
So, think about it. You've got all these dead bodies lying around. They're running out of space, because it's like, I don't know, why they're running out of space, but they haven't got much, I don't know why, really. I was going to say, they should have just buried them, but, well, there's probably more land back then than now.
He doesn't need anyone else in the room to have a
conversation with himself.
Yeah, we could leave and we'd come back and you go, I've sorted it. Yeah.
Well, anyway, for some reason,
they presumably, if it's going to be they burnt them, it's presumably to do that it also kills the parasite or whatever's carrying the parasite on them, as opposed to burying them and not killing the disease.
Well, yeah. So that's that. There you go. You've worked it out. They piled them up and they turned it into a celebration because there was a lot of fed up people at that time.
Is this to mean the word bon, meaning good?
No. I'll tell you in a minute.
Go on.
So you've got all these people who are like going around and like, oh, you know, so-and-so died the other day. And, you know, nearly every week someone they knew was dying. Yeah. So you can imagine like just constant like being depressed.
Mm.
So, and they've got all these bodies lying everywhere. It's like, oh God, what are we going to do? So they said, we're all too fed up. At the moment. Said, let's make this a better world.
This was 1701 by the time they got together.
Yeah.
So they said, what we need to do is, have a big party.
Mm.
So they said, yeah.
Good thinking.
See what you're thinking. So, they go, right, well, we'll put all the bodies in a big pile.
Uh-huh.
And they're all diseased and that. So they set fire to the bodies.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And they said, let's have this as a celebration to remember them by. And, you know, we'll have a drink and that and have a chat. We'll have this big fire going, and it came from bone fire.
Ah, right.
So it was all the bones. Bonfire is bone fire.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah?
That's interesting.
So that's how it came about.
Yeah, in the 1700s.
Yeah.
That was.
No, probably, I reckon it was 1600.
Probably earlier.
I reckon it was the plague. I reckon it came from.
But, interesting stuff. Interesting
stuff.
So
that's,
Did you celebrate Bonfire Night? Is that a big celebration for you? Do you like the fireworks? I'm sick of fireworks. I just think it's they're rubbish.
I'm not impressed.
I've never been impressed by fireworks. Even as a kid, you know, you have to go to like sort of community kind of gatherings with a bonfire and fireworks, and some local vicar or whatever would come out. And
but I also think the adults think the kids love it, and if they just got together and said, "Should we go see it?" They'd all go, "No." Let's not go this year.
It, what would be better is if the vicar had wheeled out like a massive rocket, climbed in, gone last one to the moon as a bender, and then fired himself off. Now that, I'd pay to see. That's a fireworks display I'd like to see. As it is, it's just rubbish.
Oh,
rubbing.
Dear.
Yeah.
That's your feeling, Cole?
Yeah, I'm not keen.
No.
Sorry, what clue was that?
We'll have a big fire tomorrow.
Bone marrow. Bone marrow. Genius. That's a plague record.
Oh, God! Good to hear that again.
Always good to hear that.
Suede. Animal nitrate. Carl's all flustered because there isn't a record set up and he's getting all tizzy. He's been more worried about his competitions than sorting out putting records on ready.
I'm after Steve's Song for a Lover.
Well, I'll tell you what, you, why don't you carry on with your educating Ricky section? I'll have a look on the
secret. We'll keep it going, Steve.
Yeah, cover you keep it.
Go on. Go on then, right, okay. We've had a few emails. Anyone got it right, Carl? Anyone
Ricky, educating Ricky, that's the final one. We've got to get that out of the way.
We've got to get Rockbuster as well, though.
We can do that at the end. We can
go on then.
But we've only got 5 minutes left.
Come on, just do educating Ricky.
Right. Oh, God. The last one that we haven't done is, he's a bit of a nuisance.
Go on then.
Again, not really that interesting.
Thanks.
No, like, again, I spoke to you in the week and I had much better things, like when I tell you about Brian Blessed climbing Everest. And for some reason it made him, played havoc with his belly and he followed through and he had to clean up.
Shat himself.
Yeah, using ice and snow.
Why are you telling me that Brian Blessed, in what way is telling me that Brian Blessed shit himself once in any way educational?
Because I was saying how he was climbing Everest, right?
Right.
I give it to him, he's an actor and that, but he gave that a go.
Yeah.
Right, he played,
What's the point of that, you'd say, wouldn't you?
You'd say, God, he's you know.
So he's all right. Me doing a boxing match for no reason is rubbish, but him climbing Everest and shitting himself.
Yeah, he did that.
Is commendable.
Right, and he's only going to like go and do it again. He's going to climb it again.
Yeah, but he might not shit himself this time.
Yeah, what's the point in going? Nothing's changed up there.
Yeah, good point. Yeah,
good. Been?
Well, it has. They've probably cleared it up by now. Right, but, slip on it.
I can't even bother telling you this one, because-
Come on! Just honest, do it, or do it now!
Steve, how are we doing?
Look, no, never mind that. Look, just tell me what that means! Oh, he's a nuisance. Oh, this is so annoying, Carl. I'm gonna go mental.
Right,
talk!
Right, listen, I'm just putting this in here, right, nuisance is a bit of a nuisance.
Yeah.
Apparently, the old fella who used to hang people-
1700s.
He used to be able to tell somebody's weight just by looking at them. Right? That's a bit of a bonus fact.
We'll be the judge of that.
The thing that I wanted to tell you is, money for old rope, do you know what I'm saying? I can't even be bothered.
Yes, you're gonna tell me now. Come on, Carl.
Right,
I mean it.
Basically, money for old rope came from the right.
What was all that about? He can tell someone's weight. What was
that
for?
Fact.
And Brian Blessed shitting himself. What are you? What? No, don't you. No, tell me that now. You nearly made me swear. Then I'm getting really annoyed. I'm getting really annoyed now. Tell me this back, Carl, or I'm gonna go mental. Come on, Carl. Time's running out.
More than people years ago. When people used to be hung, right?
Right.
If you didn't like the person who's been hung, you'd go, God, I really don't like him. And so you never forget the time.
Presumably, if they're being hung, we take that as red.
Yeah. Well, so they never forget afterwards to get the hangman to get the rope and to cut it up into little pieces and he'd sell them. He'd sell the little pieces of rope to people.
See, Carl, that's the most interesting thing, if it's true, that you've come up with.
Right. Okay. And so they sell the rope.
They sell the rope, and it's money for old rope.
Money for old rope.
Meaning, like, you know, God, it's easy to make money, that all I have to do is cut it up and sell it.
I'm cynical.
I'm not so convinced.
Right, listen, we're really tight. We haven't even got time for a last joke. We've got an ad break and we've got to give out.
Okay, give the answers then. This is ridiculous.
So, Steve, do you want to pick a winner?
I've got a winner when you give us the answers.
Okay, so the first clue was that army has got some well nice trenches.
Yeah.
That was DW.
Who's that?
Dandy Warhols.
That's brilliant. That's brilliant.
Right. That's good, yeah.
The second one. The top of them curtains are wrecked. All the material is worn. Yeah. HV. That's Holly Valance.
Oh, he got a phone call for a woman saying I haven't heard it. And she went, he was talking to her off air. And she went, what is it? Someone said, them curtains. She went, all right. He said, you know the thing around the top of the curtain is a palmet, not a valance. And he went, cut her off.
Yeah, but. My auntie's always making valances on everything. I'll tell you about that next week, right?
I'm looking forward to that.
Right. Is this the one that farted for 5 minutes?
Yeah, yeah, the very same.
Yeah.
Right? So, we'll talk about that. I was in Texas, I tripped up, I landed on my knees in a puddle, WH.
Yeah.
Whitney Houston, right?
Whitney Houston.
Yeah.
So, you're a maniac.
So, who's a winner?
We've got Pete, Catherine and Laura in Newcastle upon Tyne. They're listening online, I assume, and they're
going to get
those great phrases. And remember, they've got loads of stuff. They've got the DVD here, they've got Linda Green, they've got Stone Roses, they've got another compilation, and Executive Decision.
What did you read about Brian Blessed? Is it actually true, or have you libeled
no,
someone else?
It was an interview with him in it.
And what did he say? Oh, come on, what did he say?
He said, I climbed Everest and I played off it with me belly. Let's talk about it next week. We've really run out now.
Oh, you're a fool.
Boy with the Arab Strap, Bell and Sebastian. Coming next, Educating Ricky.
You too, Electrical Storm. Steve, am I mental or have we been playing some great tunes
today?
We've
been playing some great tunes. You're not mental. You're a genius.
Yeah. Our next FM 104.9, Ricky Gervais, would be Steve Merchant and Carl Pilkington. Carl Pilkington in the chair now. The talked about, the acclaimed Educating Ricky.
Right, well, just in case anyone's new, doesn't normally listen, basically, I'm Educating Ricky.
Yeah.
Do a bit of research in a week, find stuff, news, history, anything that's interesting. Three stories, I give them a nice little headline, you take your pick.
Yeah.
Between now and three, you're gonna learn three things. Yeah?
Yeah.
So, the headlines are, I'll be no buying one of them.
Give us that again.
I'll be no buying one of them.
Nice, okay.
Yeah. We've also got, Hippopotter News.
Okay. Okay.
And, Chicken You Believe It.
Chicken You Believe It. Well, I'm gonna go for Hippopotter News.
Hippopotter News?
Hippopotter News.
Right, well this one, it's, I'm not gonna take the credit here. I heard Christian talking about this on Breakfast, right, because it's a good story that happened. Basically, I don't know if I told you about it last week when we were having our spaghetti, but,
I think you did! Right, I know what it is! I know what this
is! I've not heard this.
Right, there's a little midget, right, there's a circus-
I'm loving it already.
Circus going on somewhere, I think it was in America.
Yeah.
And,
is that present day or old times?
I'm talking like in the last 3 weeks.
Okay.
Right? Little midget, circus, really packed out show, people are loving it.
Steve, you asked the same question I did, I know.
So, so there's a little midget jumping up and down on a trampoline.
What's a circus?
Right. I take good money to see it.
So, everyone's clapping and he's getting carried away.
Because he can't believe they're loving it. I didn't know they'd like a little person on a trampoline, but they love me.
But you know what it's like when, if there's a crowd of people sort of encouraging you to sort of go higher and stuff.
Yeah.
And I'm sure he knew it was getting out of hand. But he was jumping and he was coming down, they're all going, hiya, and he's going really high in the air, right? So he's doing this, crowd are clapping. There's a hippo, right, just sat next to the trampoline, getting ready to come on and do his act.
Oh, right, I thought he was in the audience.
Getting ready to do his act, Steve.
Yeah. So,
he's a ventriloquist.
What do you mean he's sitting by the trampoline waiting to do his act?
Because it's
why does he sit in the dressing room and they go, 5 minutes, Mr. Mus, 5 minutes, Mr. Mus.
So anyway, right, so the hippo's there,
he's getting annoyed, is he, because this, because the midget's
he's going, how can I follow this? How can I, this is really annoying, they're going to be, no.
So
he's thinking, he's already done the trampoline, my pogo stick act is never going to work.
Yeah, go on. So there's a hippo waiting. This see, it's a great story, and I just know he embellishes it or gets slightly wrong. Go on.
So
there's a midget jumping up and down. The hippo's getting annoyed.
The crowd are going mad. The midget's loving it. Can't believe his luck. Although we think, you think, he probably knows he's dicing with danger.
Yeah. So next thing you know, they're all saying higher, higher. He gives it one big, like, heavy sort of landing on the trampoline, goes really high. But goes off at a funny angle.
Oh.
Hypotenuse.
Okay.
Yeah. And sort of flies off.
Hypotenuse! Hypotenuse!
Sure.
Flies off at a funny angle.
Ooh, dear.
Hippo's there, swallows him whole. Crowd are clapping, thinking that's why the hippo was waiting there.
Rubbish. Rubbish.
It's not rubbish, though.
And but no, maybe there was an accident in a circus with a midget and a hippo, but at no point was this hippo waiting to go on going, come on. The midget flew off at a hypotenuse and landed in the hippo's mouth and was swallowed whole. This is what you embellish it. That is great. And what's
I have to say though, Rick, when I heard midget trampoline hippopotamus, I was thinking accident waiting to happen.
Yeah.
So yeah, maybe. I mean,
it is it that you should never put those three together.
Never.
It's a recipe for disaster. It's everyone knows that midget trampoline hippopotamus. Are you mental?
You're asking for trouble.
Well,
you know when he told me it, he said, and the midget he didn't mention the hippopotamus, and he said the midget went on and soon he fell off, and the hippo ate him. And I said, sorry, what was the hippo doing there? He went, it's a circus.
I've never heard of a circus having a hippo.
No, what do hippos do?
What can they do? You can't train them, can you?
What do you
aren't they, like, very deadly? They're huge, aren't
they? You can't have a hippo in a circus.
Are you sure?
You're not thinking of Zippo.
He's neither clown.
Yeah. It wasn't some sort of where Zippo was eating a midget and it's some sort of horrible sexual act.
No, it was definitely, I heard it on breakfast, right?
Oh, okay, sorry.
No, it's definitely fact.
Yeah, okay,
definitely
right, okay, good. Well, let's play a record then.
So,
I'd like to play a classic Springsteen. We're all fans of Springsteen there. This might be his debut album, I'm not sure. Greetings from Asbury Park.
I think it is, yeah.
New Jersey. And this is Growing Up. It's great, it's classic.
Mm. Sorry,
Springsteen. Lost Cause on XFM 104.9. Wow. Carl. We haven't had a lot of emails. They're tough.
I'm struggling.
Yeah.
I've got one, and I'm struggling with two, but I know one of the words, but I can't think of the band that fits it unless the clue's wrong, and I've got no idea with the first one. E.
Give us them again.
Just quickly
again.
Recap. Number one, the fella has only got one badge left. That's E. Second one, the unmarried lady's a friend he out with. That's M D. And the last one, I really, really love that woman. I love everything she does. That's M.
Well, so, Ricky, what is it, Ricky?
Ricky.gervais@xfm.co.uk.
So keep those coming in. If there's no winner, we don't know whether to give it to the person who gets the most right first or have a massive rollover. And what a Christmas booty that would be, as Carl said.
Mm.
All those, imagine what you could have, indecent proposal, maybe.
Who knows?
You know what I mean?
I've got some real junk, so I can bring that in.
Yeah. The Mean Machine.
Imagine someone
Vinnie
this
Jones.
Christmas. Yeah, exactly. This Christmas. I can't believe it. Oh, thank you so much for the Pelican Brief. I noticed you left the price on.
And it's on VHS as well.
Oh, great.
Brilliant.
This is a perfect Christmas gift, isn't it?
Yeah, it's great. Okay. Now,
that's going on.
That's a big, big, big prize. It's a big weekend prize on XFM. Educating Ricky, part two. Right, what's the clues
left? Well, we've got left the headlines, I'll be new buying one of them.
Yeah.
And we've also got chicken, you believe it. Chicken, you believe it. So, they're the two that are left. Which one's
right.
You
looking for? Chicken, you believe it is not that picture, is it, in that we saw?
Which picture?
The bloke with the
No.
Right,
no,
okay.
God, that was bad.
Right, okay.
So,
I just explain
that. We can't really discuss this on air, can we?
Well, we can. Steve brought in Carl the best book ever, which is what is it?
I found it when I was moving house. It's an FHM publication. And it's kind of like lots of grotesque pictures and stories, and like the book of the a book of freaks and weirdos and.
And Carl opened it, and the first one was like
at the back.
Well, you couldn't believe your luck, could you?
What was it? What was number 50?
A bloke with two heads.
And he said, "What's number one?"
Yeah.
And then number 6, there's a bloke who's a squid or something.
Octopus.
Yeah. He's loving it. At number 1, he said, "Well, it's just a fella under a rock." And I went, "Oh no, read on, I think I know about this." And it's the fella that was found, he caused a landslide while having sex with a chicken. And they pulled him off and there he is, the chicken owner. Right, so Carl could not believe his luck. So it's not that.
Chicken, you believe it?
I love that one.
You're going for that one?
Yeah.
Right, well, we've talked a lot on the show about,
We've talked a lot on the show?
Yeah. About animals without heads.
We talked about cockroaches could live without a head for 7 days.
Yeah, we talked about that, and then of course there was the the well-known one about the fella who had his head cut off, and he
blinked.
He said to his mate, "Count how many times I blink when my head comes off."
Yeah, when you told it to me, you said his head came off, and he said, as he said, was in the basket, said, "Quick, count how many times I blink." And it was Nick Frost that had to go, "No, Carl, no, he said it before." I went, and that was lovely. So yeah, we've talked quite a lot about things heads coming off. Go on then.
Well, this one, yeah. Right? Back in 1945.
Oh, you looked it up the date.
It's got a specific date, wow.
Mate Jonathan sent this one, you know him as well, the lad at the BBC, right? He emailed this one in. Mm. So thanks for that. Chicken, it's called Mike.
There's a chicken called, sorry, I missed a bit there. There's a chicken called Mike.
Okay. Right?
Yeah.
What happened was, it was living on a farm, right? Loads of chickens knocking about, and the owner of the farm is like, you know, getting ready for tea, and his wife says, "Go out and get a fresh chicken because my mum's coming round."
Mm.
So he thinks, "Well, I want to get a good one in because I want to impress her." Because back then, even then, they wanted to impress the mother-in-law and that. So they said, "All right, I'll just nip out and get one." So he sees Mike, chicken running around.
Is this during the war or after the war?
1945. I'd say that was after.
No, ended well.
It ended in 1945.
Yeah, okay. September. Go on.
Yeah. So, chicken's running about, he thinks that one, you know, that looks alright, I'll have that one.
Mikey.
So he picks it up, and he cuts his head off.
Oh.
Puts it on the block, cuts his head off, runs about a bit, like they do. He thinks it'll stop in a minute, keeps running about, and what's going on here? Right? He's now like chasing the chicken without an head.
Yeah.
He's saying he should die in a minute. Anyway, doesn't die. Chicken's walking around with no head, lives for 18 months.
Yeah.
Chicken with no head.
Yeah.
What do you think of that?
Well, I'll tell you, I've heard this story before, Rick, and the explanation, as I understand it, was that certain vital cords, spinal cords, weren't severed when the head came off, so that was why it continued to live.
Yep.
I don't know if that sounds plausible.
It's fine. Absolutely fine. How did it take on protein and energy?
The fella who owned it, he said, "Well, hang on a minute." He said, I could kill it now.
But I've got a wonder chicken here.
But he's thinking, it must really want to live.
Sure.
Right? If it survived that, they sort of got something here.
Yeah.
So he, what he does, he gets a little, eye droplet thing that he used to use on it. Obviously not anymore. Right? And he filled it with grain and water, and it had a big hole in its neck where its head used to be. And he,
incredibly.
And he dropped.
You know what? There's I mean, that is possible then, if it, you know, without infection, without infection, if he's taken on things, it is possible, right? Why?
Why what?
Why did he do it? How cruel is that? I mean, that was not cruel because the chicken obviously, you know.
He said if he thought it was a bit fed up, he would have killed it. He said, but he was running around quite happy.
Well, it wasn't fed up at all because it had no brain.
Well,
what do you mean, well?
I'm just saying what
it was. Nothing. It was just sinew and nerves and electrical impulses breaking down energies. Right, that's all it was. It didn't have a brain, so it was. But I'm worried about the psychology of keeping a pet without a head. I'm worried more about what the farmer was thinking than the chicken.
I tell you this. What I'm the question I'm asking is: was the mother-in-law impressed? I mean, that's why he set out. That's why he set out to shot Mike's head
off. This is lovely, but it's just the head where you don't kill a chicken like that all at once.
I thought we were having chicken for dinner. Come and look at this running around the yard.
Yeah. Oh dear. So,
there you go. You've learned something there.
Yeah, I have learned something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So. The, one more.
That farmer, I've learnt that farmer was very strange indeed.
Yeah.
I have to say, to be fair to Carl, I've been feeling like when I read it, the reason he kept it alive was as a novelty. He sold, he got charged people to come and see the incredible headless chicken called Mike.
Right.
So, here we are.
That's great.
So, tune, Steve?
A tune, yeah. I just thought I'd like to hear a little bit more from that NERD album. We played some of this from then when it first came out many, many moons ago. Since then, it's gone on, it's won awards, all sorts. And obviously, NERD now, Nerd, as they're sometimes known, kind of big producers. They're producing Justin Timberlake, Britney Spears, all kinds of people. But this is a track from their album.
I've heard they're wicked.
They are indeed. And this is called Things Are Getting Better. NERD. Oh. NERD from their album In Search Of, and that's Things.
Swade's new one, Obsessions, on XFM 104.9. Well, I'm Ricky Gervais, obviously, Steve Merchant, Carl Pilkington. Well, Carl, that's about it, and we got sidetracked on the last Educating Ricky. You telling me about a man whose arm grew.
Well, something, well, something went wrong. I'm not saying it's, it grew, just saying.
What, the rest of him shrunk?
It went long.
It went long. What, is that growing now? What do you mean it went long? Did it grow, or what, did it come loose?
That's what I was thinking.
Oh, so it was hanging by a thread that's made it look long? Yeah. Within the skin?
It's like how you can stretch a pair of tights if something is too heavy.
Arms are very much like tights. They are very much like tights.
So the one that we didn't get round to on Educating Ricky was, I'll be no buying one of them.
Go on.
Are you familiar?
Oh,
with the same white elephant?
Something is a white elephant. Yeah, I think so.
Hold on. You phoned me last night and said, what does white elephant mean? And I told you.
Yeah, I know, but I know where it came from, but I just was wondering what it was about.
So how, in what way is Educating Ricky you calling me up and asking me something?
Well, do you know how it came about?
You've given away some of the secrets of the show there, it would appear. I didn't realise he was phoning you for information.
Well, he just asked me what the term white elephant meant in sort of like colloquial.
did he say, why are you interested, Carl? No reason.
No, go on.
Well, what it is, ages ago when-
So what do we understand white elephant to mean?
It's- Well, some of that's useless, that's like a bit of a, you know, you know, something that you wouldn't want around that's just stood there doing nothing.
Yeah.
I'm looking at you, Carl.
So, so years ago, when people used to use elephants.
Years ago, go on.
When people used to use elephants?
Yeah, more than they do now.
Right.
more than they do now!
This doesn't involve a midget, does it?
No. So, you know, they'd use them in the workplace and stuff.
Sure, as factories. Sort of,
To move stuff around.
Teenagers. Yeah, security guards.
Yeah. Can't trust them with the buns, though. That's why they stopped using them.
Oh, right. God, go on.
So there was loads of elephants knocking about. And the thing is, right,
you couldn't move from.
If you have a lot of something, you also have a lot of demic ones, don't you?
A lot of what?
You know, sort of demicky ones, ones that aren't right, really.
Demicky?
Well, you know, like, they weren't properly. They weren't properly.
Sorry, Carl, what are you doing?
Right, I'm getting to the story. So what I'm telling you is
they were a bit demicky, so they weren't properly.
Have you started making words up?
Right. Yeah, you Stanley Unwin.
Listen,
reincarnated. Demicky? Well, yeah.
There was a lot of albino elephants knocking about.
Okay. Where? Where is this?
Olden times. Africa.
Should we say Africa?
Yeah. If an answer's got a question mark at the end, I'm not sure.
It's either Africa or India, but I'll give you a clue. Well, these elephants, do they have big ears or little ears?
I didn't sort of notice the size of the elephants. What I noticed is they were white because they were albino elephants.
Okay.
Right? So that's why they're heading, I'll be no buying one of them.
Okay.
So, what would happen is people who didn't know what they were doing, like, you know, you get people making a mistake buying cars that are full of problems and that. Back then when people were buying elephants, they'd go up to someone, say, I'm after an elephant, and the fellow would say, yeah, I've got one here for you, this is a nice one. Mm-hmm. And it was all white and stuff, and it had, like, blue eyes.
You should never trust a used elephant salesman.
It was just this elephant that's white with blue eyes.
Right, so,
this is great.
So, yeah. So a fellow who didn't know what he was doing would buy the elephant and he'd get it back and it'd be all sort of lazy and stuff and we'd be doing the stuff. Yeah.
Mm.
And he'd say, what's up with this? And his mate, who's a bit of an expert with elephants, and go, oh, where have you bought that from? And he say, oh, I got it off that fella, and he goes, oh.
All this embellishing nonsense he does with the story.
You shouldn't have bought that. So he goes, why? And he says, it's only albino, isn't it? And he's like, what does that mean? And he said, oh, it gets tired. Yeah. It's not that good at doing work and that. You shouldn't have bought
it. It steals from you.
But elephants back then were like a god. You know what I mean?
Right.
You couldn't say, oh, I'm sick of this and I'm going to abandon it or anything, okay, because elephants were seen as like pretty high up on the chain of things. So they'd end up being stuck with an elephant, that's an albino,
yeah,
couldn't do much, gets tired, basically gets in the way. So they said, that's where they're saying, like, you know, but a bit of a white elephant there.
What do you reckon, Rick?
I feel like I haven't been educated. I feel like I've lost something. So that time in my life that I can never get back. I feel like I've sort of been soiled, and I don't know where to start. I'm angry. Do you know what I mean? I'm angry.
Sure. Yeah, I can see that.
And all that rubbish around. Look at his little face. Well, what was that, all that shit about a second-hand elephant salesman and his mate knew about elephants? What is it? What are they? They had blue eyes. What are you?
Well,
albinos have red eyes for a start.
Oh, that's it. We've run out of time.
Oh, yeah. What? What are you going to do about this next week? Are you going to actually do some educating next week? And what about Rockbusters? Are you going to make the clues proper cryptic clues?
Well, that's the teaser, isn't it? That's what we'll leave them with.
Will it be any good next week? Yeah. Tune in and find out on XFM 104.9.
Papa Garcia, Natalie and Nusi from the forthcoming album Bring Me the Head of Papa Garcia. Catchy, that.
Hmm.
Quite retro. It's a bit of Elton John and
all sorts of things.
Yeah, lovely. Right, here we go. Quick clues again. And then we better do Educating Ricky.
This is the favourite bit of the show for me now, Educating Ricky.
I love it.
I can't, I'm anxious all week.
Well, just quickly on those clues, just in case people need to know again. Stop throwing that fruit about, CB. That Scottish fella's made a bit of an error, M. And, God, you can make loads of toast with M. That's, G.
Alright, brilliant. Ricky.Gervais@xfm.co.uk. It's email only.
Oh, yeah. I need some learning. I need some knowledge, Carl. Right. Educate me.
I might be able to help you.
Go on.
We've got three things, as always. I give them a little heading to tease you as to which one you want to learn first.
Yeah.
First one is the tip included?
Is the tip included?
Like it.
Second one, I want to come here in hindsight.
Right. I wouldn't have come here in hindsight?
Yeah.
Okay.
And the third one, am I gonna have to thump you?
Am I gonna have to thump you?
Mmm.
Okay, and you've trawled, what, the internet?
So if I can get into the mindset of this plan, is the tip included? Well, obviously, that's probably not gonna be about a waiter. It's gonna be, if that's someone losing the end of his knob, I assume. Am I gonna have to thump you? That's a man who lost his arm in a fight, but then picked it up with the other arm and smacked him with it. What was the middle one?
I want to come here in hindsight.
Hindsight.
Hindsight?
It, someone was blinded by baked beans.
Sure. So what are you going for then?
I think I better go for, am I gonna have to thump you?
Right, well, this isn't. I've been struggling again, to be honest with you. searching high and low for stuff, and some of these I had to leave till this morning.
Right, because there's just not enough knowledge out in the world, is there, that you don't know about?
I found out about something in the week about a guy who, was playing tug-of-war.
This is bonus material, isn't it?
He was playing tug-of-war.
Oh, his arm came off.
Only his arm come off.
Yeah, he got caught up in the rope, yeah.
No, he didn't. He didn't get caught up in the rope, he just was trying that hard and didn't want to lose. He kept holding
it. But he allowed his arm to be pulled off?
He really wanted to win. And the other team pulled it and his arm come off.
No.
Well.
I don't know who to believe.
Well, think about it. If he's gripping,
yeah.
As soon as there's tension, like the arm coming out of the socket, the hand might release. I think his arm got caught up in the rope, and so it was involuntary, as opposed to him going, "Well, my arm's coming off, but I'm not going to lose this."
You might
anyway,
be right.
That's the fact.
That's
not
a bonus. That's a bonus fact.
Yeah, well,
that's educated me.
Well,
a man lost his arm. Oh, interesting. Go on.
Am I going to have to thump you?
Yeah.
Do you know the saying, shut your face?
Is that yeah, saying? I've heard the well-known Shakespeare, innit? Yeah.
Do you know how it came about?
No, Joe Dolce.
Nope. Go on.
It's, ages ago.
Oh, yeah, literally, literally.
Like, knights who wore armour.
Okay.
That's, armour going after thump you, that's how it came about.
Okay, armour.
They wore all the stuff, and they had the helmet, and say if they're guarding something at night, stood outside a castle or something,
yeah.
And there's probably going to be two of them, right? So they stood there talking and that, and, talking about stuff, and-
The future.
Medieval stuff.
One of them's like, oh, I wish you'd shut up, you know, I've been stood here for hours, and he's going on and on.
Yeah, sure.
So he'd say, shut your face. Meaning, shut the guard down on your helmet.
The visor.
And I can't hear you then.
Uh-huh.
So shut your face.
Shut your face.
And that's okay. That's how it came about.
Well, I suppose that's- It would be interesting if I could just rely on it as
I'm not sure it's true, yeah.
I know, I just never know, I can-
It needs to be corroborated.
It's like, I don't know where he got it from, but anything via Carl is precarious.
Yeah, like. I mean, I feel like maybe you should give us your sources next time. You know, tell us where you got this information from.
Got it off the internet.
Yeah, but where on the internet?
I can't remember where that one was. I mean, I always go through, like, the news pages and stuff, and I
this news should be updated because they've only reached the 17th century, which is last week with people eating, tomatoes off lead plates.
Then I look at news and there was stuff about a woman who was in a shop and she, I don't know, they had some workmen in doing the shop up, and they had some wood glue left out and she asked for some pear juice, and then the guy went and thought the glue in the thing was the pear juice and she went and drank that, but that's not really news.
No.
So I thought, well, we're not having that.
I wish you hadn't told us.
There was one about-
So there's some poor woman now whose tiles have fallen off because she tried to put them up with pear juice.
Yeah.
See, that's the danger of mixing up pear juice with toxic glue.
Yeah.
Your wallpaper and your tiles and everything just fall down.
There was also-
Be careful, everyone.
Be careful.
There was something about, kids having hamburgers, it makes them fat.
Hamburgers- hold on. What? Having food with high fat content can make you put on weight?
Yeah.
Don't believe it. You're an idiot. What's the next one?
No, let's play a tune,
You've still got to come. I want to come here in hindsight, and you've still got is a tip included, but we've got a bit of,
Well, I think we haven't played anything for a while, have we, in terms of the hip-hop hooray feature that I used to be so popular for. So I thought we'd just resurrect that for 1 week only.
Pete didn't pick up on that one,
did they? Let me just remind you, hip-hop hooray was where I played a hip-hop track.
And then I said hooray, or-
Yeah, no, well, no, I think you didn't even know that.
Brilliant.
That's a great thing, though. We could add that in. We could phase that in. Maybe at the end of the, song you can-
Hooray.
Brilliant.
Brilliant.
Okay. No, check it. Featuring Puff Daddy and Lil' Kim, that's Notorious B.I.G.
Brilliant.
And, Notorious.
Great. Lovely. Carl just, said to me, yeah, here's something. You can't hold your breath to death.
Have you tried it, Carl?
It's just another little lesson.
There's someone here who's in a really low ebb. They've been listening to a show, they're gonna commit suicide.
They just
start holding their breath and thinking, oh, screw it.
Well, what did you learn in the week, right? I'm always doing all the educating. I asked you, you were talking about watching a programme about jellyfish.
Yeah.
And I said, well, that'll be interesting. I'll try and find some stuff out, but I couldn't find anything that I didn't already know about them.
It must be difficult for you to find anything you don't already know.
So what did you learn about jellyfish?
I agreed with you by the end of it that they should be wiped off the face of the earth because they're balls of water in membrane, right, that go around stinging people to death.
Yeah.
Let's lose them, Carl. Let's lose the jellyfish. Yeah?
That's what I think. Because I was stung by one. Did you know?
Oh, you got stung by one?
Yeah, I was on holiday and got stung by one.
Yeah.
And I don't understand.
No,
I don't
understand them. I'm not a fan of them.
So that's that.
Good. So, well, that's sorted out the jellyfish conundrum. We've solved that particular worry.
Right then. Yeah. So, take your pick then.
I asked him if he could have any animal the other day. Did I ask him on air as well?
Don't know.
Off air, he said, I've got it down to two. Right, and this was, he said, what favourite animal looking at, or could I own one? And I went, you could own one. And he went, right, but could I own one, or would I have trouble? I went, Carl, you've got all the expertise, you can just have it in whatever it needs, and you're going on there. He went, right, and I won't regret it and get fed up. I said, no, Carl, just what animal, if you could have any animal, what animal would you love? He went, I've got it down to two. I went, what is it? He said, either the rhino or the hippo.
What's your logic?
Well, I don't know. That was then. I mean, ask me tomorrow and I might have two other favourites. Do you know what I mean? When was that?
A couple of weeks ago. When was that? Well, you were there.
Yeah, but, you know.
What are they today? Quickly now. First animal comes into
your head. Quickly now. Any animal I want.
You could have any animal in the world. Right. From party, one that's maybe extinct. Anything you want.
Right. I might have, just for today.
Just for today.
I might have a scorpion in a little box.
A little scorpion in a box. What's your thinking?
It's the chimp every time. It's the chimpanzee or the gorilla.
No. But, have I told you that program about the scorpion? How they all help each other out.
Right. Have scorpions all help each other out.
No, 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 this is brilliant, right? Somewhere in the desert.
Okay.
There's these little
the desert.
It's like these little monkeys that are underground or something. And there's holes.
Is this beneath the Planet of the Apes? The fourth in the series.
Are they talking apes?
Oh, forget it, actually.
No, and you've got it wrong anyway. They're not monkeys.
There's little monkeys under the goose.
Yes,
what are they doing then? They're toiling in some underground mines.
They're lizards, if you remember. And the lizard goes to sleep, and the bloke comes along. You've told this. And the
we've done it. All right.
Monkey from monkey. That's what happens in his mind. From lizard to monkey. Oh, evolution would have been so much easier if Carl was around. Oh. Right. Turn it into a monkey. I'm fed up with a lizard.
Just so promise me once again, Carl. I've asked you before. Promise me you'll never have children.
Go on, right, okay.
Right, what are you having?
Well, what are they again?
Is the tip included?
Yeah, go on that one.
Right, in Turkey.
Nice.
It's not, actually.
Mm-hmm.
That's where I went and there was them little fellas after Suzanne in the kitchen.
What? What do you mean?
We stayed in we went to Turkey.
You went to Turkey and there were some little fellas.
Well, they had quite a few sort of midgets working in the kitchen.
Why? Is it a theme?
No,
was it a theme holiday?
I don't know. Might get them cheaper or something.
Was it?
So
they
were working in the kitchen, and one of them fancied Suzanne and kept sort of eyeing her up, and she was winding me up, saying, "Oh,
not eyeing up and down, just eyeing her up."
Yeah, yeah.
Anyway,
what was she doing in the kitchen?
No, it's like a pick what you want to eat type buffet, but you have people clearing the tables and that ready for you to come along.
Are they low tables?
And and you know, he was just keeping an eye on her.
What would he say though? Was he what was it? Was
it was Turkish, so I don't know what he was saying.
He was a little fella.
Did he talk?
What do you mean a little fella? What do you mean little fella?
Sort of dwarf like.
What do you mean dwarf like? He had magic powers or he was 4 foot. No, what do you mean, Carl?
A little bloke, just a like a normal bloke but small. If you stood him in the desert you wouldn't know.
But he'd be right, Carl.
He should watch out for the monkeys.
Yeah, underground.
There's underground monkeys.
Look, you can't just say there was a little midget fella who was eyeing up my girlfriend and then leave it. What do you mean? What was happening? This is a story to us. This is much more interesting to us than she was deaf, right? And she hit her head. That's much more.
I don't understand how this how it manifested itself. Did he come over and say something?
No, do you know? You know when it's like girls know, don't they? When someone fancies them.
What do you mean? There was lots of them as well.
Do they? That's worth knowing.
Listen, right? Come on. Right. So you went into this. You went to this holiday, yeah.
Yeah.
And you went into the dining room or something.
Yeah, downstairs.
And you looked over.
You thought this is odd. There's no one serving.
Yeah. And they go,
wait a minute.
Hold on. You looked down, and there was a little waiter.
There was loads of them running around busy.
Why though? Why?
Because it was summer.
What do you mean?
Because it was summer.
They had more of them.
They come out in summer. They come out in summer.
What do you mean they had more? What do you
mean? Because it's busy, isn't it?
No, but they hibernate in the winter.
Why were they all midgets?
I don't know. Maybe it doesn't heat stunt your growth or something.
No.
Well, they just happened to. Maybe it was a thing that they did for tourists or something. I don't know. I just got on with my meal. It was a holiday. Do you know what I mean?
So some midget serving. I'm not going to ask any questions.
Right. Okay. Yeah.
So they're all little fellas running around, and this one always was like, you know, oh, do you want a new server yet? You know what I mean? Going out of his way to sort of
turning on the charm.
Yeah. Yeah, he was going out of his way. The others weren't.
Right. I think what was happening is he'd been working with Santa all the winter.
Yeah.
Or sort of little summer break.
This one was your waiter, and so he was being polite to you.
Maybe. Maybe. Maybe.
But what did Suzanne say then? When
she was using it to wind me up.
What was she saying? Always,
oh, just like, you know, look.
He may be small, but he's built like a
he's all man.
So
were you jealous of a midget then? You were jealous of
it. It is a bit annoying, isn't it?
Why?
It wouldn't bother me as much now because I've been with her for ages.
Right.
But at the time, that might have been one of our first holidays, and it's like,
You don't want to be stolen.
I've paid for this holiday.
And then you get off with a midget.
Yeah.
Oh.
So anyway.
But it doesn't matter because you got chatted up by a bearded lady.
Yeah. Tell you what. No, that's got nothing to do with that.
What were you going to say?
I was going to say the hotel was half board and maybe.
Oh, right. I thought you were going to say it's just one of her shortcomings.
So listen, right.
Play a record.
Right. Baddie drum boy. Born again. Right. Just get this Educating Ricky out of the way. So, Turkey, yeah. So what is this again?
This is Educating Ricky, is a tip included. Right. Apparently a fellow was on holiday in Turkey. Just having a normal holiday, weather's good, you know, he's having a good time.
And weight is a real normal height.
Yeah. He's having his meal. He hears a load of screaming going on in the kitchen.
Hold on.
Has his girlfriend wandered in there?
And they do,
with a stepladder.
The circumcised people in the kitchen, and apparently—
What are you talking about?
Whoa, slow down. We were sidetracked there for a minute.
What are you talking about? Well, I'm just excited about two things at once here. One, they circumcised people in the kitchen. Two, I guessed it was someone losing the end of their knob.
He did, yeah.
I started thinking like Carl Pilkington.
Extraordinary.
That is amazing.
Apparently it was going on. It wasn't just a one-off either. Well, when I say a one-off, I mean they did it more than once.
Yeah.
Right? And there was, he was there for a week, and apparently the first night it was quiet, and then the rest of the week, every day, it'd be like having his breakfast, or even his lunch, or even his tea.
Yeah.
He'd be doing it all day.
Oh.
You'd be hearing
lunch
screams.
And breakfast, fair enough, Rick. Yeah, circumcision at tea time.
Don't do that.
And apparently it's a tradition over there. You can't even make a complaint about it. It's like, well, you should have, you know, should have found out before you come over
here. See,
it.
I can't believe this is
Sorry,
true.
I'm a little
like,
bit
I can't
lost.
Believe the, this is
he
true.
Was in a restaurant, in a hotel, and there were people having circumcisions in the kitchen. Yeah. Is that right?
I'm even worried that we're bordering on the racist here, suggesting that that is tradition, that Turkish people cut the end of their cocks off in the kitchen.
Yeah.
At meal times.
Mm.
I think you're wrong, Carl.
This just sounds ludicrous, Carl.
No, I don't think it happens everywhere.
Right.
I think this
just in this, this hotel.
Certain places.
Certain hotels.
Certain hotels.
What is it, like 2-star?
Yeah.
No, I
why did he go to the Foreskin Inn? It was his own fault, wasn't it?
So that's
Sorry, that's it, is it?
Have they closed?
Wait. That's the story. You educated me, right? Once a fella saw some Turkish people cutting the tip of their knob off in the kitchen. Thanks very much. Thanks very much, Carl. Got any more?
Well, there's things you can learn from it. Either don't go to Turkey.
No!
Don't have calamari when you're over there.
yeah. Carl, you've done it again.
Well.
You too. I love that one. On XFM 104.9. I'm Ricky Gervais, Steve Merchant. Carl. Okay, Carl, one more.
Can't we just-
Don't get the ump, just because so far you've come up with nothing. What's the last one?
Give us the teaser clue again.
It was, I wouldn't have come here in hindsight.
I wouldn't have come here in hindsight?
Yeah.
Right, give me some education. This will be the thing that teaches me something. I can feel it in my bones. Come on.
There's a kid in Kenya. he was messing about with some beans.
Magic.
We guessed that as well. You did, yeah. He's fed up because we've guessed his puns, I think.
He put one of them in his ear.
Yeah.
the mum or the dad said, oh, what have you done that for, or whatever.
Yeah.
So I'll have to take you to the doctors now. So they took the kid to the doctors. And the doctor said, oh, he said, I can get that out, I can sort that out for you. So, he took it out. And the doctor said, right, that's £3.50. And the dad said, I've only got £2.70 on me. And the doctor said, right, well, and he put the bean back in his kid's ear.
I don't know what to say. I mean, I don't know what to say. I mean,
a couple of questions from me very quickly. Are you sure that those were definitely the sums involved, were they?
Well, the equivalent of whatever the deal with in Kenya.
Yeah.
It was the equivalent of £3.50.
Oh, so what currency was it, Carl, that you translated into sterling?
I don't know. No, it was saying in the thing, it said the equivalent of
£3.50.
Did it say that?
Yeah. Sorry.
Did it say that?
Yeah.
Carl, look at me. Did it say that?
Yeah, it said that was the
Did it say that?
Yeah. Yeah, it did. it definitely said that. Definitely.
Yeah.
So, it's just like, I suppose, I don't know, I mean, all these things, the idea is, it's not like a lesson, it's like, I'll tell you this, see what you can get from it.
Sure.
So you look at what I've told you already, the knights who said shut your face, that's like-
that's amazing.
That explains itself.
Yeah.
Turkey with the circumcisions in a restaurant.
Yeah. You know, that'll hold me in good stead, yeah, go
don't,
on.
Don't go there, whatever. Yeah. This one, if you're in Kenya, don't put beans in your ears or something. Doctors
or carry £3.50 or the equivalent
it's just the idea that the doctor put it back in his ear. He forced it back in his ear. So is it still there to this day? I mean, is there any update on that story?
Or did he go back with the £3.50?
I presume he either went and got like a second opinion, see if he could get it cheaper.
Right.
By another doctor.
Yeah.
Or he said, right, I'll come back next week.
Yeah.
After I've been paid. Or he saw how the doctor did it and thought, well, I'll have a go at that. Sure. I'll get home.
Yeah, for free.
But he never said what it, how it ended.
No, no.
But, I mean, I apologise for this week. I mean, I haven't got that much out of it.
You've not been enriched.
Oh.
It was very, very light. Like I said, there was the tug of war. There was a fella in Scotland who had a load of tattoos.
Okay.
Is that it?
Is that the end of the story?
98% covered.
Right.
Just between his toes, he didn't have done.
Uh-huh. Why not?
Because it looks stupid. I don't know. It just said 98% done. What else?
Are you gonna drop the feature? Are you worried?
I'm thinking about it.
Don't drop the feature.
To be honest with you,
Heat have probably written about this already. This has been a classic.
I'm concerned because it's my favourite part of the show. I'm wondering, is there something else we could? What could we do to help you out? Because I hate to see it go.
Well, we can't really. And he's moving this week with the old fella, so that'll take him about 4 days. I'm worried that you're not. I'm worried you're not looking in the right. Why don't you go to a library?
Quick question for you, Carl. Who is a possible guest on next week's Pilkington?
What are you going to investigate?
I mean, what about your removals, man?
Right, listen. If you've had a experience, it can be anything, right? It doesn't have to be you've seen a ghost. It can be that you think you're going to live forever, or you can, you know, do to any mentalist out there. If you're slightly, you know, wrong. If there's something wrong with you, just email Carl. Is it carl.pilkington@xfm.co.uk? Yeah. carl.pilkington@xfm.co.uk.
Would you like to be interviewed on next week's edition of Pilkington?
If you are a mental of any description, just lonely, bewildered, stupid, just something wrong with you, right, and you've seen something that's, you know, interesting to you but absolute bollocks, then please call Carl.
Yeah. Carl.Pilkington.
Don't let that put you off, by the way. Don't make think, oh, they're going to take the piss out of me. Just if, you know, in any way, if it's, you know, fodder for us, then call up, because Carl will like you. You'll be friends with Carl, won't you? Yeah. Quick, the clues. What's the answers? We always do this. We're running out of time.
Don't worry, we've got a tune, and then we'll come back with the answers for Rockbusters. Sure. A lot of great prizes.
All right, we'll have a bit of cash.
Yeah. Cash. One of the prizes we're giving away.
Oasis, Live Forever on XFM 104.9. Right. We're in the swing of things. It's mine and Steve's favourite bit of the whole show. This is what we do this show for now. Educating Ricky.
Yeah.
Go for it, Carl.
You said learning can't be fun.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll go for the one. What's the one about the butcher going down the butcher shop?
Get your kit on, we're off down the butcher's.
Yeah.
You going for that one?
Yeah.
Well, do you know the saying, don't let the cat out of the bag?
Yeah.
Do you know what it means?
Yeah, don't give away a secret.
Right. Well, do you know how it came about?
No.
No.
Well, ages ago, before, like,
ages ago. 17th century?
Yeah, before, like,
yeah, yeah, 17's good. Yeah.
Before, like, you know, proper butchers and Dewhurst and supermarkets and that, you used to get these blokes who sold meat.
Right.
Butchers, they were called then, I think.
Yeah, yeah, but the difference was they didn't stay in the same place, they moved about. Right, so they'd turn up on a street corner,
right,
and he'd have, like, loads of carrier bags of, like...
Carrier bags?
Yeah, with, you know, with meat in and that, and people would
plastic
be like,
carrier bags.
Yeah, with whatever. Mobile butcher on them.
Yeah, yeah.
Right, so,
had an email address.
Yeah, go on.
People went, right, yeah, I need some meat, right, so they'd, they'd go up to this bloke and, say, what have you got? And he'd say, well, I've got a, you know, you can have a bag full of pig, or you can have, whatever, bag full of chicken, whatever. Yeah. And they'd go, yeah, how much? They go, oh, you know, call it a fiver, whatever.
Yeah.
And they'd buy them, and to make more money, they didn't always fill the bag with what they said was in it.
Oh, and yeah, I thought that might be the case.
Right. Yeah. So what
did they put cats in there?
Yeah.
But I don't see what.
Okay, so sometimes they would put a cat in the bag and pretend it was chicken or whatever else.
Yeah, so
why was a cat any cheaper than a chicken?
Because cats are wandering around the streets, aren't they? Chickens aren't. So they'd get a chicken, they'd put a chicken on the top so that when they look in it, they'd go, yeah, that's all right. Got a bag full of chicken. They'd get home to make the dinner and they'd be like, what are we having tonight? And they'd go, well, you'll never guess. And they'd have like, you know, well, you can have a chicken leg and, you know,
but it wouldn't be, it would be a cat. They'd have to defrost a pizza.
Yeah.
Oh. Did they mind that they were eating cat then, in those days?
He didn't say. He just was saying about the saying, don't let the cat out of the bag. It's like, you know, if they see that, they're gonna go mad.
I'm mildly disappointed with this story. It's all right if it's true, but yeah, there's something about it, it's just, I want to know more. He always leaves you. Is it Carl doesn't quench your thirst for knowledge, he creates more. I don't know if that's a good thing or not.
Well, yeah, he's like the pot noodle of information.
Yeah, do you know, I want to go-
I'm not nourished by it.
It's if for every fact he tells me, there's 10 others that spring up that I have to get clear.
Well, so it was the people that were doing this, it was the dodgy butchers that coined this phrase. Were they saying to each other, don't let the cat out of the bag? I.e., what I mean by that, Jack, is don't let them see the cat.
Yeah.
What we've stuffed in there.
Yeah.
Dodgy butcher, that's another phrase, isn't it?
So that's the first one.
Is that a euphemism or is that dodgy butcher?
As his meat delivered around the back.
Sure.
So that's that one. So let's get your kit on.
What does that mean?
It's a euphemism for homosexuality.
Okay. And meat, presumably, in that means different things.
It doesn't. It's a word that is also a male
would it,
bird.
Would it mean chicken or cat necessarily in that context? Or well, I suppose it could.
Yeah. Carl's look at him. Carl looks at you like a cat.
Yeah.
Whenever we leave him behind, if we don't talk like straight at him and let him see our lips moving, and it's, you know, monosyllabic and very understand. Look, he's lost in that conversation there. He just drifted off, didn't you, Carl?
No, I just was also thinking on animals and that something else I was gonna use.
Go on.
Was
this isn't a radio show, is it? I just suddenly caught myself. This is nothing.
I told you that before. It's been bad today.
No, but I mean, it's the way, this casual way that it's like we almost have no regard for our listener. And I'm not proud of that. I just don't know what to do about it. Do you know what I mean? I don't know how to do this properly. I mean, we're just chatting here. I mean, it's only Anderson who's seen through us. And that surprises me that more people haven't. I mean, what are the figures like? Do people listen to this show?
I'll find out for you.
You keep saying that.
But, yeah, there's this parrot, and, apparently, it lives
I mean, Rick, it's unique, if nothing else. I mean, when you wake up with Woken tomorrow, you're not even gonna hear him start a line with, there was this parrot.
Go on, there was this parrot, yeah, go on.
And it can talk and that, someone's obviously, you know, tore it out, how to speak and that, and, it flew away, and it's living in this church, right? And, people are at the church doing hymns and that, and then-
Trouble's brewing.
In between
if
the hymns-
If that parrot was owned by an old, miner who used to swear a lot-
Well-
Then the vicar is gonna be really annoyed. That vicar. Yeah. That vicar's gonna- go on.
I just hope it stays quiet, Rick, during the vicar's sermons.
Yeah, go on.
Have you read it?
No, go on.
Have you read it?
No, go on, because that's what happens, right?
Go on, tell us, Carl.
During the hymns, it's sort of effing and jeffing and stuff.
Effing and jeffing?
Yeah. And everyone's like going, oh, you know, it's quite funny, really, you know, it doesn't know what it's doing. Everyone's having a laugh.
Yeah.
But it's causing a havoc at funerals.
When did this happen?
Not years ago.
John was a much-loved man. He was a wanker!
Yeah.
So, anyway, so that was another story.
What can you say about Uncle John?
Bollocks.
Oh, Carl, I love the fact that when you look at things, you go, that's interesting, a parrot swears at funerals.
That'd be a nightmare.
And it stays with you. You see, for a simple man, you retain an awful lot of knowledge. It's just all rubbish.
It's all
you. Do you know what I mean? If you just replaced all this rubbish with good stuff, you'd be an intellectual.
Yeah.
Really. Because, I mean, your attention is fantastic.
Yeah.
So did I lose you again there, did I? Was it the word retention?
We've still got, Wash Up With You.
Yeah. Should we play a record and do Wash Up With You?
Yeah, we'll play a bit of Aqualunga.
Aqualunga!
From the album Original Pirate Material, it's obviously The Streets, and an album track from that, It's Too Late. Fantastic, isn't it?
Yeah.
I know everyone's raving about it being, you know, one of the albums of the year, but it is, I think.
It's great. That's brilliant. I love the backing as well. Mm. It's just so good. The lyrics, the things you go, they're my favourite band of the year. Next week, then, we'll do all our favourite songs of the year, shall we?
No, I think it's got to be 2 weeks, Tom, hasn't
it? Oh, 2 weeks, is it?
Yeah, we'll I'm away Christmas. Next week as well.
What do you mean you're away next week? What are you doing? Zoe Ball show?
I'm going up north again.
Why?
So Claire's going to be here with you.
Okay. Yeah, at least
what are you doing up north?
She does her job.
Just Suzanne's dad's birthday.
I bet he's a party animal. I bet I've heard that they really kick off, don't they? Is it? Yeah. When? So you gonna be raving?
Can't concentrate now.
Oh, well, he's all stressed because the lady from MTV is here. She's gonna film his little face. So the things he said in the week. He was so worried. He's got worried about the spot on his head. That won't come out. Just that he got your best side.
On that side. That's all right.
All right. Yeah. The camera's out. Look, he's getting nervous now. Okay, Carl. Ignore the camera. Okay. Just ignore the camera. Okay. Now, me and Steve have done our research for you, and we've got two amazing things to tell you. What's the thing first, about the baby or the
Well, they're both equally fascinating, so you choose.
I'll tell you the crab thing first, right? Steve actually saw this thing in The Guardian the week, about our research thing, and then we looked it up, we looked into it on Friday, and it is incredible. Right, listen to this. There's a thing in a bay in, New England, right, where it's like the biggest, they make silicon chips and stuff for computers, right? And because of the data protection thing, after they've done them, because they have to destroy the plates, right, well, the information's sort of put onto them, but there's still flakes of silicon. They sort of grind it down straight away, and some of the flakes got into the bay, okay, but some of the information's still on the, even the slight granules of silicon. Anyway, gets in the water, and silicon is rather like, a carbon derivative. They reckon if there had been life on another planet that wasn't carbon-based, it'd be silicon-based. Because that's simple sugars and proteins, it's just COH and that, and it can work with silicon, right? Anyway, the crabs have been taken up, it's down in the water, and they looked out on the beach, and, over years, the crabs have started, sort of putting themselves in formations. Like, geometric format, and they couldn't work out why they were doing this. And, when they put them in the experiment, they sort of like chopped them up, and they found they'd taken on silicon. And it had sort of got into their brain, and they were downloading information. They actually, they picked up little things, because it's just chemical, you know, like, electrical impulses that got information off the silicon chip. And they were interfacing it, but this is the amazing thing. One bloke sort of thought of this, and he thought, well, if it's a simple computer, the brain, if it's just a simple sort of electrical thing, then maybe there's sort of, you know, we could get it down. So what they did is they made a thing called a bio interface, and they put it into the crab's brain, just a really simple brain, so it's measured avant-garde, right? And it got impulses from it, and they were getting, like, computer readouts, just flashes of, like, symbols and geometric things were on this screen to read the crab's brain, and it was stuff like, you know, fragments of a
What made them do this in the first place?
Because they saw that they saw the crabs behaving differently. They were behaving differently to each other. They were just like you know, intelligent, and they were sort of solving problems and all this sort of stuff. Anyway, when they downloaded the thing, it was like a there was some they found one of the secretary's names where it had been on the silicon chip, where it was just a, like a flash of a computer screen. But the most amazing thing is, they downloaded a memory, right? It was like a snapshot where it had been burnt onto the retina of the crab, just a snapshot or something, and it was like a picture of the beach, like a couple of years ago, right? And they also did, incredible, it was like just a digital black and white sort of thing, so they could see what the crab had seen.
Amazing.
Jeez.
Amazing.
So
intelligent crabs.
What are they doing with them now, then?
Super brain.
Well, they think, this is the upshot, they think they could use it as spy crabs, because they could put these, get these crabs. Also, the other thing is, as generations went on, right, so they put a crab in the sea or something, right, lots of crabs in, and then as generations went on, a newborn crab, they downloaded the memory, and it had the memories of
It's great, 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 all together. It had every memory that any crab had been related to it beforehand. Cause it passed it on, it just passed it on.
So not even ones that had been eating the silicon stuff?
Yeah, no,
these are just like ones that have had kids.
Yeah, yeah.
And they've got like—
And they know every— so you'd know everything, your great, great, everything right the way back.
So would that work if we ate silicon?
Well, possibly.
So what are they gonna—
Well, they can use them for all sorts of things, though. I mean, that's what's incredible. I mean, I don't know how you train it particularly. I don't know, it'd be quite tricky to train, but I'm assuming they could, if they can do it that way, then presumably they can give it like certain silicon information, which they can then plant in it, if you like, within its sort of food.
Also, if you get them onto enemy beaches, you'd have like 1,000 digital cameras just
sneaking around. You could get like, you know, Osama bin Laden or someone just calling around.
They don't understand the information they've got.
No, they don't know they're doing it. They just download messages.
You could torture them, and they won't be able to sort of give you the information because they wouldn't know what the information they had, because they're just—
But the first crab they downloaded, they just kept seeing the same picture of a big crab feeding it, which they—
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. That's what, like its mother crab or something?
Yeah. As just it was memories of it as a child.
But they're not in colour, presumably, because—
No, it's all in black and white. It's just a digital camera, because it's just a— they don't see in black and white, so it's just like a— I don't know, I think it's burnt onto the retina or something. And, the only one that they kept were the ones they saw a lot of the time.
Well, I mean, in a way, some of the educating Ricky I've got for you today is on the similar lines.
Right.
Oh, you've got to be impressed by that. You've got to be impressed by that.
No, that's pretty good. I mean, I'm interested to see, you know,
what the crab developments are.
But yeah, that's pretty good.
Yeah.
But, I mean, amazing.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Well, just digest that information, because that's not even the most impressive one we found.
I think it is.
I suppose it's pretty impressive, but the next one's more, maybe more shocking.
Okay, right.
But let's play a tune, and Ricky's got another experience.
Okay.
Cure, love song, classic on XFM.
So that's the crab that can— you can download their memories.
But what about other animals that are in the sea, in that same sea, eating the stuff? Have they tested them yet?
I don't know. I think they just took it on because their biology, something to do with— I presume they could take up minerals and, you know, I don't know why. I don't know. But anyway, next one, this is just on Horizons, a bodybuilder, yeah? Had another bodybuilder, married another bodybuilder, right, and they were pregnant. And, they had these tests, and the baby was very large, but it was causing it pain, right, in the thing, right? And it— after a—
It's almost bizarre, and like—
Yeah, after the female woke up pregnant after 7 months, and the baby—
Walking around.
No, it forced its way out of the vagina.
Oh, no way.
Yeah, it forced its way out.
It almost had super strength, like—
And it was pulling her along by the umbilical cord, and that, and it was a stone.
Extraordinary. That— no, that's freaky. I mean, you talk about freaky stuff.
That's made up.
What?
It wasn't pulling her along.
She could feel it.
Exactly. And it was— do you know what I mean? Like, just went— And just sort of squeezed
just
its way
got out because it was ready because all the hormones.
Because it thought it was ready.
Oh God!
Imagine that, just waking up and finding that in the bottom of the bed. Freak out, wouldn't it? Because you'd think it was a nightmare initially.
And it had hair and everything, didn't it?
Yeah, because all the hormones.
It was something in the week about you know, you've got test tube babies and that now, haven't you? Mm. But they've managed to do it. I only caught half
the story. I knew he'd be more impressed by the crabs than that. He doesn't care if it's
human. No, I am. I'm telling you, though, that there was something— I only caught half the story because I was busy. But, there's something about babies being able to be born without having any people involved. Or something. It's like putting them in an oven or something, and it's like a cake. And after a certain amount of time, it's ready.
I think you can buy those in Argos for kids.
No, it's Christmas.
Well, it's my first baby kit.
Yeah. It's Play-Doh, I think, that they can buy.
Yeah. So what do you think of that then?
The baby one.
Yeah.
I prefer the crab one.
Yeah.
But the baby— I mean, the baby thing's pretty horrible.
Yeah.
So it was bigger than the average.
But, both made up. We made those up.
Yeah. They're both rubbish. Despite the fact they're both rubbish.
Yeah.
They're interesting.
We made those up. Both those stupid stories up.
Yeah.
Imagine downloading a crab's memories and seeing its mum feeding it as a child.
Both are rubbish.
I had trouble. Yeah. I knew I was gonna have trouble with, pushed its way out of the vagina.
Yeah.
I practiced that about 30 times yesterday with Stephen. I was going, I'm not gonna be able to do it, mate.
Yeah.
I'm not gonna be able to say that.
Yeah.
Are you disappointed?
A little bit. I mean, the baby one's a bit sort of out there.
Yeah.
I wasn't really having that one.
No.
But the crab one,
See, now, what's interesting, I think, is it's a useful experiment, Carl. I don't know what it's taught you about yourself. But would you say that that's revealed to you a certain thing? I don't know, maybe... That you're a bit gullible. I mean, you know, what I'm saying is maybe you shouldn't accept or swallow hook, line, and sinker everything you read on the web. Do you not think maybe a valuable lesson?
I feel bad because I said to Steve, he won't be annoyed that we conned him, he'd be annoyed that they're actually not true. You'd love that crab thing to be true, wouldn't you?
It wouldn't surprise me if it did happen one day.
Sure. Yeah.
So, and then he'd laugh.
And he's in the right when I said about the crabs, you went, well, I'm keeping them then.
Yeah.
Right, well, I know what you're getting at. with the Educating Ricky, but, you know.
Let's see.
You've got, three titles.
Yeah.
That I tease you with, different stories, you take your pick and I teach you something that did happen.
A little bit of venom. Yeah, go on.
First one is, don't rub it too hard, you'll get a rasher.
I bet that's bacon related, knowing you.
You've got, you've got enough is anus.
Say that again.
Enough is anus.
Enough is enough.
Well.
But it's changed to enough is an anus.
Yeah. And you've got, You've also got, will it be a bloke, oh no, will it like a bloke or a woman?
What?
Will it like a bloke or a woman?
Will it?
Yeah.
Will it like a bloke or a woman?
Wow.
Yeah, so there are your three stories
today. Okay, sounds exciting.
Okay, well, I'll have will it
like- we're gonna play a record now, Rick, surely.
Yeah, okay.
And come back with-
Sorry about the crabs and the big baby.
It's a valuable lesson, really.
I'll think of a title for him. Yeah, Oasis. The Hindu Times. Carl just did his little screen test down the lens. And, he went, I said, just look at the camera. He went, right, do you want to know about MTV? He went, well, it might be VH1. He went, right. It did Rockbusters, then said, after the break, some Genesis.
Oh, I'd watch it.
You didn't tell me she wanted all this. I thought you said, because I said, you just bring your own camera in and we'll put it down on some tape and pass that on to her.
Yeah.
So now, this, I'm doing two jobs at once again. This is what I'm saying to you in the week. I'm juggling jobs all the time. I tell you.
Right, come on then.
How much do I get?
He looked straight at the camera and said that.
Right. So, three stories. Don't rub it too hard, you'll get a rasher. Enough is anus. And,
we'll have that one then.
That one?
Yeah.
Richard Ashcroft, Science of Silence on XFM 104.9. I love that.
Yes,
correct. He's one of my favourite artists now. I just think, he's so, I don't know why he's not ballistic. Mm. He's got everything. He's like one of our best rock stars. I'm Ricky Gervais.
Hello there.
You're Steve Merchant.
I am indeed.
Carl Pilkington over there. Big day today.
Really?
Yeah, for Carl. He hasn't been looking forward to it. He's been whinging in the week. A couple of things. He thinks he's overworked. He thinks he's overworked here and he's stressed and he's got to do DIY. MTV are coming in, right, to give him the chance of his lifetime to do just a little screen test and he's going, well, I'm not going to look good, am I? They're not going to have a why. He said, well, I've got a round head and I'll be wearing headphones. And, he's not made an effort. He thinks, oh, they'll put him off. He said, they won't even press record. He's got a spot on his head.
Uh-huh.
I mean, you know, I mean, also-
Carl, you're not looking forward to it. You're not excited about it. It's a great opportunity.
Why is it a great opportunity?
To get on MTV?
No, but-
It's money for old rope,
isn't it? Yeah, but look what's happened to people like, Jeremy Speak, whatever his name is, and all
that. Jeremy Speak, yeah.
Yeah, and,
yeah, slightly different. Slightly different.
Why is it?
Well,
see,
you're making it in the industry, and you've got something to give. He happened to be around when they were filming an airport.
Well,
do you see the difference?
All right, the other one then, who's on a boat.
Same thing, although at least she had a skill. She had a skill, you know. She can sing, you know.
Well, she's just. I think it can all go wrong. Do you know what I mean?
Of course it can. So can sit in your little room moaning about nothing happening in the world. You know, he wanted to stop educating Ricky because nothing had happened. He said, look what happened last week. I scoured the net. He said, all I found was a dog in a car wash and a parrot and a vicar.
Uh-huh.
Right? I'll tell you what, there ain't much more going on this week.
We're talking, listen, me and Steve, yesterday, we took a day off to prove you wrong, and we've come up with two of the most incredible things I told you about, and they're amazing. So there are things out there, or is it just go for truth. Go for truth and science and discovery. Fact is stranger than fiction. You don't have to revert to like God and ghosts.
I know, yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
But the funny thing is, you know, like, last couple of weeks I've been saying there's not much going on.
Yeah.
I found out when I was looking that there was a day in 1930, right? It was a Good Friday. There was no news. There was nothing going on. They had to put a music video on or something on the telly because there was nothing going on.
Play a record. We're going to play some classic tracks today. This is Debaser. Pixies, Debaser. I was looking forward to playing that. Came and said, Carl, I'll play that. I was looking. He put it on. Lauren just called through and said, we played that in the last half hour.
Embarrassing.
Oh, yeah. So, what is the point of having a producer if he doesn't check things out? So, I mean, it's a good track. I mean, I'm sorry if you heard that twice in the last hour.
Listen to everything all the time. I've been running around. I get in early on a Saturday.
You got in about the same time as me.
I went out and bought you some biscuits, so you're happy. I put the coffee on. Yeah. I've sorted what prizes we're going to give away. I've been running to the library getting you certain tracks.
Yeah.
I can't listen all the time. I'm doing my best.
Oh, I'm not sure it's good enough, Tom. I mean, I'm worried when MTV come in, if they've heard this kind of shoddy production, they're going to start to wonder what
you're playing the same songs every 5 minutes anyway.
Sorry, are you sort of overworked because you were on Zoe Ball show talking?
Oh, hello, what's going on here?
Well,
on our show.
No, I was in
I seem to remember, Rick, he was a nobody that got a chance to come on air and talk about that.
Guess what he was talking about on Zoe's show?
Oh, hello.
All the jellyfish stuff and all that.
Recycling material that you've done on this show.
I phoned in, right, and I went, stop doing materials. He just hung up on me.
Well, I had a job to do.
Who do you think you are? Your ego has just gone through the
roof. Hang on a minute.
What?
I had a job to do in the week. They asked me to drive the desk for Zoe, right?
They didn't say talk.
Zoe, if she talks to you, you can't just ignore her.
Yes, you can.
But you
can't. Who is she? Who does she think she is? You made a promise to us, a pact, that you were our kind of
monkey.
Yeah.
What can I do if someone takes time off? I've got to do it. It's my job.
Yeah, but you don't have to talk. You don't have to use.
You're the head of production. We've given you this special gig. This is like taking you out weekends.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, if we find out you're getting too much excitement in the week, we'll have to just calm it down.
Well,
get another little.
Well, that's it now. Anyway, it was only last week.
I feel like kind of solid. I feel betrayed. It's like you were having an affair behind our back, and you rumbled it.
He was doing all the stuff. He was doing all this, like, oh yeah, jellyfish and this, jellyfish.
Yeah, because she was asking, and I thought it was a good way of promoting this show. Actually.
Oh, did you mention the show?
Yeah, I did at some point.
Did you? What did you say?
I just said more about that on Saturday afternoons.
So you talk twice. I only heard you talk once. So you're talking all the time.
Well, about 5 times in the week, in the full week, 5 times.
Theory.
And one, it was just stuff.
You could never be a monk, could you? Chatting away all the time. Right, what have we got?
I blame Ball as well, to be honest. I feel Ball's slightly responsible for it. She can't find her own, you know, Gibbon to get on the show.
Yeah.
She can't find her own kind of, you know, loser, then don't start stealing ours.
Well, coming up,
maybe we'll get Fatboy Slim in.
Indeed.
Next.
Yeah.
Saturday, if you're listening, Slim.
Yeah.
Come in on the show.
What's his name? Ernie or something?
What's his name?
Norman.
Norman.
Oh, yeah.
Ernie! Yeah.
Oh, that's great, Ernie Ball.
Yeah.
He wouldn't change his name. That's great.
Anyway, coming up today, we have got Educating Ricky.
Okay. Is this the last one? You've promised it might be.
I believe there's a book out that might help me with this feature, so we'll see how it goes. I was thinking of new features in a week. I've got, what did they come up with? I wanted to do Celebrity Fact Club.
Celebrity Fact Club, alright.
So I've just got to get some celebrities in first. Okay. So we can kick that off, so maybe in the new year.
Ball and
maybe
Cook.
Maybe Zoe Ball, yeah.
Ball and Cook, start off.
Maybe, right. And I've also got,
Cook and Ball stories.
Yeah. That's nice.
Good one.
Cheers. Thanks, Carl.
Yeah. Maybe you could sell that to Zoe show.
And, I'm also thinking Through the Ricky Hole.
Through the Ricky Hole, okay.
What's that?
That's, I'm quite.
No, you just got the title again, haven't you? Okay, play record.
So, Rockbusters coming up as well.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Wu-Tang Clan, Gravel Pit on XFM 104.9.
We're playing some great music today. Yeah, I wonder if we should maybe, you know, it's getting towards Christmas to think about others. Should we dedicate the show to all the people in the world who maybe are less privileged and less fortunate than us?
No.
No? Okay.
Have you, to do the prizes for the,
Prizes? Okay. All right, so screw those who are less fortunate, is what TV's Ricky Gervais thinks. Rick, I know you're a big fan, of the likes of Bryan Adams, Robert Palmer, Alien, Ant Farm, and, obviously, ZZ Top.
Yeah.
And so you'll be enjoying the best air guitar album in the world ever, Volume 2.
Yeah, sure.
Fantastic.
Well, Volume 1 wasn't enough. That wasn't enough.
Exactly. again, we've seemed to be able to give one of these away every week. Are you just not sending these out? I mean, these are the same prizes we started this game with, I think, a couple of weeks back. Are you just not sending the prizes out?
Yeah, but I want to give, like, more people a chance, because if 1 week they listen in and think, God, I wouldn't mind winning that.
Sure.
If you if you've got more copies of it, they'll go, well, I'll listen next week.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
So again, this is one of those the best songs you've heard on an advert ever albums.
Mainly mobile phones.
Mainly mobile phone adverts. Yeah. Although there is the Smash Mouth one, which is used in the Ford Fiesta TV.
Yeah. Walking on the Sun.
I forget what it is. The Smashing Pumpkins album that we've given away in the past again.
Yeah.
Obviously got a bulk order of those that can't shift them. Wild Weather. I don't know who's interested in this. This
what, is that a double box set VHS of different weather?
that's amazing.
Yeah, there's
that is
two
amazing.
Cassette tapes there. It's presented by Donald McIntyre. It's a thrilling trip with the most exciting forces of our wild and turbulent world.
So, I'm right in saying it's a double VHS video set of different weather?
Yes.
Brilliant.
Yeah, no, it's got, I mean, it includes the fastest winds, the hottest desert, and the biggest rain machine on the planet. That's on there, I think you have to.
Oh, God. I wonder if I hope they're bringing out another box set, Soil.
Yeah, absolutely.
Just goes through different mud.
and this you may be of interest. I've read good reviews of the DVD of this. It's a two disc set. The Wicker Man, the classic 70s film, but it's got a bunch of extras
that
in there.
So
that's actually worth having. I would probably throw the rest away.
But the Wicker Man, get the on DVD, and it's quite very interesting.
Yeah, but you'll enjoy that. So,
what this Rockbusters, is it?
Yeah, that's for Rockbusters.
Brilliant. Well, I say get the ball rolling now.
What, of Rockbusters?
Yeah, get the ball rolling.
I don't know, I mean, tease them, Rick. Don't, you know, don't sort of spunk all the good stuff early on. I mean,
well,
that's dynamite.
You can say spunk, I can't. Go on.
Well, we've got, actually, it's quite good moving it about, because we might have some new listeners here.
Yeah.
And I would have thought so.
Yeah. Not after last week.
No.
Right, okay, so if you haven't heard it before, I'll give you some initials. You know, it's like initials of an artist or of a
band.
It's
Blockbusters.
And a cryptic clue to who the band is. There's two easy ones, one difficult one. first one is, that'll never get off the ground.
Right.
Yeah?
That'll never get off the ground? The
that'll
initial?
Never get off the ground is the clue.
Not LZ.
And the initials are LZ.
You are joking.
Two easy ones.
Right.
Yeah?
Okay.
Right, and then you've got, that woman's got her husband's gloves and a pair of her own.
Right. Say it again?
That woman has got a pair of her husband's gloves and she's got a pair of her own. That's HH. Right? It's a bit of a difficult one. And then the last one, you'll get a right load of bacon off them, right?
You'll get what?
A right load of bacon off them.
Uh-huh.
That's L.
L?
Yeah, so, once
you'll
again,
you'll get a right
quickly,
load of bacon off of them?
You'll get a right load of bacon off them.
Uh-huh.
So, first one, that'll never get off the ground, LZ. That woman has got her husband's gloves, and she's got a pair of her own. That's HH.
Brilliant.
And, you'll get a right load of bacon off them. That's L.
And so, it's an email-only competition.
Email only, ricky.gervais@xfm.co.uk, and we pick a winner before the end. So,
and you can win that win at Wicker Man.
The weather.
Best of the weather. Weather.
The best of the weather. that would be amazing. The best of the weather.
As a compilation, Channel yeah, 4.
Exactly. Winds light to variable.
I love 1976
Remember
weather.
Remember this one from August 1979?
Oh, warm, isn't it? Oh, this is warm, isn't it? Oh,
the best of the weather.
I'll tell you what. You remember how we always played, like, great music, usually? I'm up
You've not got another, one, have you?
Yeah, I'm gonna do it again. Yeah. This is David Bowie driving Saturday.
Oh, finish it again. I'm in
the
same pump.
I know, eating a biscuit.
Yeah.
David Bowie driving Saturday. Mm. That's a great track, isn't it? A crash course for the ravers, eh? That's what this show is, isn't it, Carl? Crash course for the ravers. They tune and they go, wow, that's so cool. I wish I was like Carl Pilkington.
You reckon?
Yeah. Definitely. You've got to read your mum's clues out, didn't you?
Yeah,
these are just for fun only. This is Carl's mum. She listened 1 week, and now she sends him
a little example of Rockbusters every week.
She's got, what did she send? This group would go well with your Christmas dinner.
Cranberries?
Yeah. They make a few good cupboards.
They make a few good cupboards?
Yeah.
The carpenters. Carpenters.
I was thinking of EMF.
what else? I was thinking B&Q. The B&Qs.
This group thinks of lots of things.
This group thinks of lots of things.
Yeah.
Go on.
Imagination. I think they're the best ones.
Yeah,
they're the best ones.
Obviously, we want the worst ones then.
Here's one more. She'd really like Blackpool.
She'd really like Blackpool. She'd really like Blackpool.
Fairground attraction. Not bad.
Yeah.
Not bad.
Right, so, there's,
does she write anything else in the letter? Or does she just send them, like, on a scrawled on the back of, you know, I don't know, a till receipt?
She did with the first one, now it's just the Rockbusters.
Right.
Really?
She doesn't bother asking how you are or-
Well, I'll speak to her in a week. Right. On the phone, so yeah.
What kind of conversations would you have then with your
mum? What do you say? Stuff? Do you moan about how overworked you are and stuff to her?
I mean, they're always surprised when I'm getting in late and that. It's like, you know, what have you done today? Well, I've just got in from work and it's like 8:30 at night.
A lot of people get home at 8:30, Carl. Next.
You know, just saying, how's the flat going? I was asking my dad some DIY tips the other day. You know, usual sort of stuff you talk with your mum and dad, really.
Yeah.
Talking about the Bisons with them. I was did you watch The Mammals in the week?
No, I missed
it. David Attenborough.
No.
I was thinking, actually, right, all this MTV stuff, if there's one reason why I'd like to do it, is I was watching Attenborough, the Mammals programme, I reckon I could do something like that.
Right, right.
And just have like me, instead of Attenborough, like a, you know, a young, sort of fresh person.
Yeah.
Watching, like, certain animals and saying, do we need these? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. Oh God! What's going to be death on earth?
Well,
that's amazing. Do we need these?
And no, because there's loads of stuff.
And the audience at home would vote. Would there be some kind of telephone
like vote out system?
Oh, yeah,
the thing is, it's like, it's something interesting that Attenborough was saying the other night on.
Do we need these?
On Jonathan Ross's show, on his telly show, right? He was saying. He said you could take all the humans off the earth, and it would carry on, but take like some animals off it, mammals and that. You got problems on your hands.
Mm.
I thought that was quite interesting.
Yeah.
So it's like the question is, do we need these? Is that part of the big thing?
Right.
Like jellyfish.
Yeah.
We've talked about jellyfish.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So which mammals in particular were
you talked about
on
Zoe Ball show, haven't you?
Hey.
Which mammals were you thinking we don't need when you watched the show the other night? Any in particular that you thought they don't need them? They're not of interest.
Well, I like whales, but I don't know what they do.
And okay.
They're taking up quite a lot of room.
Sure.
But stuff like, but like, jellyfish, I looked into because, you know, well, I was talking about them. Yeah. And, they were saying they've got no eyes, no heart, they're something like 97% water.
Yeah.
They're blind, and they do about 33 miles a day.
Right.
So it's like, do we need them? Could we clear them out?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, a big net.
That would be the programme. What, right, we'll get rid of them. Next week, we'll be looking at,
rhinos.
I think it's genius. Yeah. Honestly, I think it's genius. And like going along sort of like picking up sea anemones and going, and just lobbing them into the sea.
Well, what do you think about MTV doing that? And then I just, in between the bits,
play music video?
I play music related to fish, so I could play like fish.
Yeah.
Like rock guy. Or, the rock, animals.
Rock lobster.
Yeah. Or, what else could
this
we get
could
in
run
there?
And run.
What other songs have got animals in them? The monkeys? Could play the monkeys?
Yeah, there's about a million, so let's not start this.
No,
yeah,
but, do you know what I mean?
So, do we need this?
So MTV flies you around the world to the most incredible exotic locations. You sort of climb up a tree or whatever next to, I don't know what lives up a tree, some kind of rare parrot. You say, look at that, it's colourful, it's interesting.
Oh, you like sloths, don't you?
No, they just live up trees, but I'd say, do we need them?
Mm. Why?
Well, what do they do?
What do you mean, what do they do? What do you want from an animal? Carpentry? What do you want?
I don't like scorpions, right?
Right.
But then I found out they look after those monkey things.
They're not monkeys, they're lizards!
Well, alright, yeah, them lizards, they look after the lizards. So there's a reason.
But do you need the lizard? Could be your next question.
Because the local people made shoes out of them.
But not when the scorpion protected them, they didn't.
All right, we don't need them then.
Okay.
So, and so ultimately, you would anyone decide? I mean, do the animals kind of get a chance to mount a case for their survival? I mean, is there maybe someone that comes into their corner and sort of defends them?
I'd have like a David Attenborough type character who says, well, they do this, and I'll go, yeah, but do we need that doing?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, and so what does an animal need to do in order for you to feel that it sort of gets a chance of life? I mean, like a pet, like an animal, like a dog maybe, or a cat, I mean, they give a certain affection to its owner. Is that a valid reason to survive? Not particularly for you.
Not really.
No, okay.
I've been saying that though, blind people use dogs, so they are useful.
So dogs are useful. Farmers use dogs. Save people, don't they, in snowy weather?
Cats. I'd have to think about it.
Okay.
Keep the mice down.
Yeah, but you got Rent-A-Kill. Okay. So what I'm saying is, what I'm saying is something that will affect the world.
Right. I think you'll find everything does. I think you'll find everything does.
Mm. Except Carl. I'm not sure what effect he's having on the world.
I tell you what though, Steve, right? Did you watch the mammals?
I did see the mammals.
They had bison on it.
Right.
The weirdest looking things you've ever seen.
Yeah.
They've really
Again, you're on dangerous ground here, Carl.
They've really got a it's like decide what you want to look like.
Okay.
It's just a mismatch of stuff. It's got a really big hairy head.
Yeah.
Unlike you.
Sort of bald at the back.
Right.
Sort of
it's like, someone you went to school with.
Was there two of them? Oh, brilliant.
From the album Original Pirate Material, it's obviously The Streets, and an album track from that, It's Too Late. Fantastic, isn't it?
Yeah.
I know everyone's raving about it being, you know, one of the albums of the year, but it is, I think.
It's great. That's brilliant. I love the backing as well. Mm. It's just so good. The lyrics, the things you go, they're my favourite band of the year. Next week, then. We'll do all our favourite songs of the year, shall we?
No, I think it's got to be 2 weeks, Tom, hasn't
it? Oh, 2 weeks, is it?
Yeah, we'll do the Christmas next week as well.
What do you mean you're away next week? What are you doing, Zoe Ball show?
I'm going up north again.
Why?
So Claire's going to be here with you.
Okay. Yeah, at least she-
What are you doing up north?
She does her job.
Just, Suzanne's dad's birthday, so.
I bet he's a party animal. I've heard that they really kick off, don't they? Is it? Yeah. When? So are you going to be raving?
Can't concentrate now.
Oh, and he's all stressed because the lady from MTV's here. She's going to film his little face.
So
the things he said in the week, he was so worried. He's got to worry about the spot on his head. That won't come out. Just that, so you got your best side.
He's on that side. That's all right.
yeah. There's the camera's out. Look, he's getting nervous now. Okay, Carl. Ignore the camera. Okay. Just ignore the camera. Okay. Now, me and Steve have done our research for you, and we've got two amazing things to tell you. What should I tell him first? About the baby or the...
Well, they're both equally fascinating, so you choose.
I'll tell you the crab thing first, right? Steve actually saw this thing in The Guardian the week, about our research thing, and then we looked into it on Friday, and it is incredible. Right, listen to this. There's a thing in a bay in, New England, right, where it's like the biggest, they make silicon chips and stuff for computers, right? And because of the data protection thing, after they've done them, because they have to destroy the plates, right, well, the information's sort of put onto them, but there's still flakes of silicon, they sort of grind it down straight away, and some of the flakes got into the bay, okay, but some of the information's still on the, even the slight granules of silicon, anyway, gets in the water, and silicon is rather like, a carbon derivative. I reckon if there had been life on another planet that wasn't carbon-based, it'd be silicon-based. Because that's simple sugars and proteins, it's just COH and that, and it can work with silicon, right? Anyway, the crabs have been taken up, it's in the water, and they looked out on the beach, and, over years, the crabs have started, sort of putting themselves in formations. Like, geometric format, and they couldn't work out why they were doing this. And, when they put them in the experiment, they sort of like chopped them up, and they found they'd taken on silicon. And it had sort of got into their brain, and they were downloading information. They actually, they picked up little things, because it's just chemical, you know, like, electrical impulses had got information off the silicon chip, and they were interfacing it. But, this is the amazing thing. One bloke sort of thought of this, and he thought, well, if it's a simple computer, the brain, if it's just a simple sort of electrical thing, then maybe there's sort of, you know, we could get it down. So what they did is they made a thing called a biointerface, and they put it into the crab's brain, just a really simple brain, so it's medulla oblongata, right? And it got impulses from it, and they were getting, like, computer readers, just flashes of, like, symbols and geometric things were on this screen to read the crab's brain, and it was stuff like, you know, fragments of a
What made them do this in the first place?
Because they saw that they saw the crabs behaving differently. They were behaving differently to each other. They were just like they were, you know, intelligent, and they were sort of solving problems and all this sort of stuff. Anyway, when they downloaded the thing, it was like a there was some they found us. They found one of the secretary's names. Where it had been on the silicon chip, where it was just a, like a flash of a computer screen. But the most amazing thing is, they downloaded a memory, right? It was like a snapshot where it had been burnt onto the retina of the crab, just a snapshot or something, and it was like a picture of the beach, like a couple of years ago, right? And they also did, incredible, it was like just a digital black and white sort of thing, so they could see what the crab had seen.
Amazing.
Jeez.
Amazing.
So
intelligent
crabs. What are they doing with them
like
now then?
Super brain.
Well, they think, this is the upshot, they think they could use it as spy crabs, because they could put these, get these crabs. Also, the other thing is, as generations went on, right, so they put a crab in the sea or something, right, lots of crabs in, and then as generations went on, a newborn crab, they downloaded the memory, and it had the memories of it's great, 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 all together. It had every memory that any crab had been related to it beforehand. Because it passed it on, it just passed it on.
So not even ones that had been eating the silicon stuff?
Yeah, no, that
these are just like ones that have had kids.
Yeah.
And they've got like-
And they know every, so you'd know everything your great, great, everything right the way back.
So would that work if we ate silicon?
Well, possibly.
So what are they gonna-
Well, they can use them for all sorts of things, though. I mean, that's what's incredible. I mean, I don't know how you train it particularly. I don't know, it'd be quite tricky to train, but I'm assuming if they can do it that way, then presumably they can give it certain silicon information, which they can then plant in it, if you like, within its sort of food.
Also, if you get them onto enemy beaches, you'd have like 1,000 digital cameras just
taking around. If you get like Osama bin Laden or someone, just
they don't understand the information they've got.
No, they don't know they're doing it. They just download
them. So that's the thing. So they're not like you could torture them, and they won't be able to sort of give you the information because they wouldn't know what the information they had because they're just.
But the first crab they downloaded, they just kept seeing the same picture of a big crab feeding it, which they
really,
yeah,
wow, that's what like its mother crab was.
Yeah, just memories of it as a child.
But they're not in colour, presumably.
No, it's all in black and white. It's just a digital camera because it's just a. They don't see it in black and white, so it's just like a. It's just like a. I don't know. I think it's burnt onto the retina or something. And the only one that they kept were the ones they saw a lot of the time.
Wow. I mean, in a way, some of the educating Ricky I've got for you today is on the similar lines.
Right.
Oh, you've got to be impressed by that. You've got to be impressed by that.
No, that's pretty good. I mean, I'm interested to see, you know, what they do.
What they do with what the crab developments are.
But yeah, no, that's pretty good.
Yeah.
But I mean, amazing.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Well, just digest that information, because that's not even the most impressive one we found.
I think it is.
I suppose it's pretty impressive, but the next one's maybe more shocking.
Okay. Right.
But let's play a tune, and Ricky's got another extraordinary.
Okay.
Cure, love song, classic on XFM.
So that's the crab that you can download their memories.
But what about other animals that are in the sea, in that same sea eating the stuff? Have they tested them yet?
I don't know. I think they just took it on because their biology something to do with, I presume they could take up minerals and, you know, I don't know why. I don't know. But anyway, next one, this is just on Horizons, a bodybuilder, yeah? Married another bodybuilder, yeah. Right, and they're pregnant, and they had these tests, and the baby was very large, but it was causing it pain, right, in the thing, right, and it, after this,
it's almost bizarre, and like,
yeah, after the female woke up pregnant after 7 months, and the baby
was walking around.
No, it forced its way out of the vagina.
Oh, no way.
Yeah, it forced its way out.
It almost had like super strength, like.
And it was pulling her along by the umbilical cord, and that, and it was a stone.
Extraordinary. That, no, that's freaky. I mean, you're talking about freaky stuff.
That's made up.
What?
It wasn't pulling her along.
She could feel it.
Exactly. And it was, do you know what I mean? Like, just went. And just sort of squeezed
it. Just got out because it was ready. Because all the hormones.
Because it thought it was ready.
Oh God!
Imagine that. Just waking up and finding that in the bottom of the bed. freak you out, wouldn't it? Because you'd think it was a nightmare initially.
And it had hair and everything, didn't it?
Yeah, because all the hormones, there was like
the
a hair
was
a beard.
There was something in the week about, you know, you've got test tube babies and that now, haven't you? Mm. But they've managed to do it. I only caught half
I knew he'd be more impressed by the crabs than that. He doesn't care if it's
no, no, I am. I'm telling you, though, that, there was something, I only caught half the story because I was busy, but, there's something about babies being able to be born without having any people involved. Or something, it's like putting them in an oven or something, and it's like a cake. And after a certain amount of time, it's ready.
I think you can buy those in Argos for kids.
At Christmas. Well,
it's my first baby kit.
Yeah. It's Play-Doh, I think, that they can buy.
Well, so what do you think of that, then?
The baby one.
Yeah.
I prefer the crab one.
Yeah.
But the baby, I mean, the baby thing's pretty, pretty horrible.
Yeah.
So it was bigger than the, like the average.
But, yeah, both made up. We've made those up.
Yeah, both rubbish. They're both bullshit. They are both rubbish. Despite the fact they're both rubbish.
Yeah.
They're interesting.
We made those up. Both those stupid stories up.
Yeah.
Imagine downloading a crab's memories and seeing its mum feeding it as a child.
Both apps are rubbish.
I had trouble, Yeah. I knew I was gonna have trouble with, pushed its way out of the vagina.
Yeah.
I practiced that about 30 times yesterday with Steve. I was going, I'm not gonna be able to do it, mate.
Yeah.
I'm not gonna be able to say that.
Yeah.
Are you disappointed?
A little bit. I mean, the baby one's a bit sort of out there.
Yeah.
I wasn't really having that one.
No.
But the crab one,
See, now, what's interesting, I think, is a useful experiment, Carl. I don't know what it's taught you about yourself, but would you say that that's revealed to you a certain thing? I don't know, maybe... that you're a bit gullible! I mean, you know, what I'm saying is maybe you shouldn't accept or swallow hook, line, and sinker everything you read on the web. Do you not think maybe a valuable lesson?
I feel bad, because I said to Steve, he won't be annoyed that we conned him, he'd be annoyed that they're actually not true. You'd love that crab thing to be true, wouldn't you?
It wouldn't surprise me if it did happen one day.
Sure. Yeah.
So, and then he'd laugh.
And it's in the rake when I said about the crabs, you know, well, I'm keeping them then.
Right,
well, I know what you're getting at. with the Educating Ricky, but, you know.
Let's see.
You've got, three titles.
Yeah.
That I tease you with, different stories. You take your pick and I teach you something. That did happen.
A little bit of venom. Yeah, go on.
First one is, don't rub it too hard, you'll get a rasher.
I bet that's bacon related, knowing you.
You've got enough is anus.
Say that again.
Enough is anus.
Enough is enough.
Well.
But it's changed to enough is an anus.
Yeah. And you've got, You've also got, will it be a bloke? Oh, no. Will it like a bloke or a woman?
What?
Will it like a bloke or a woman?
Will it?
Yeah.
Will it like a bloke or a woman?
Wow.
Yeah, so there are your three stories
today.
That
sounds exciting.
Okay, well, I'll have Will it
like- we're gonna play a record now, Rick, surely.
Yeah, okay.
And come back with-
Sorry about the crabs and the big baby.
It's
alright. It's a valuable lesson, really.
I'll think of a title for him. Yeah, Oasis. The Hindu Times. Carl just did his little screen test down the lens, and, he went, I said, just look at the camera. He went, right, do you want to know about MTV? He went, well, it might be VH1. He went, right. He did Rockbusters, then sent after the break some Genesis.
Oh, I'd watch it.
You didn't tell me she wanted all this. I thought you said, because I said, you just bring your own camera in, and we'll put it down on some tape and pass that on to her.
Yeah.
So now, this, I'm doing two jobs at once again. This is what I'm saying to you in the week. I'm juggling jobs all the time. I tell you.
Right, come on then.
How much do I get?
He looked straight at the camera and said that!
Right. So, three stories. Don't rub it too hard, you'll get a rasher. Enough is anus. And,
and we'll have that one then.
That one?
Yeah.
Right, well, do you believe in palm reading and stuff?
No. Yes. Sorry, yes.
Yeah, of course.
Sorry, I forgot. Yes, of course we do.
Mm-hmm. Right, well, there's a fella who, he used to do palm reading.
Oh, yeah.
But a lot of people, he found that when he went up to him in the street and said, do you want your palm reading? He was like, a lot of them were like, you know, oh, you know, I'm a bit ashamed of my nails and stuff because they're a labourer or they're a cleaner or something like that.
I know a lot of labourers are slightly embarrassed by their nails.
Yeah.
No, but.
Yeah.
So he found
at my bloody hands, Reg.
Well,
that's that hod carrying.
Did I ever tell you that? Did I ever tell you that I got picked at school to make tea and serve biscuits to old people because I've got good nails?
No, go on. Is there any more to the story?
Well, that's about it. I mean, it'd be. We used to do, like, I think the head teacher must have been getting something, maybe getting his mam in there for free or something in his old people's home. So, so, he offered the kids of the school, he said, right, all sit at your desk and put your hands on the table. And everyone did. And he walked past mine, he said, not bad, not bad.
Yeah.
And he said, you've got the afternoon off, you can go and serve biscuits and tea to the old people.
What did you say?
I said, all right then.
Was that? Yeah.
Good afternoon. But anyway,
was
so these.
Yeah,
these,
well, what did he do?
He just sort of walked around and went, you're right, do you want bourbons or digest?
I bet you'd get on with old people, wouldn't you?
Yeah, I'd love to see maybe.
Especially the senile ones.
Yeah. No, but I'd love to see you on VH1, just in a link, and just go, you know, they've just played, Robert Palmer, right? And it comes to you in a little park, and you just sit next to an old lady, go, all right? And you go, yeah, not too bad. You go, what do you think of London? Crap, innit? And she goes, yeah, it's awful, innit? And you just have a talk, and you go, alright, well, she doesn't like it. In excess. Yeah. That's what I'd like to see.
Mm. I still think my idea is better, but. Mm-hmm. So, what are you going for then? Oh, you've picked one, haven't you? yeah, so this fella.
So there's palmists going around the streets.
Yeah, he's going round and
randomly trying to give palm readings.
They're losing money. Right. Hand over fist.
Yeah.
Right? So, they said, he's what he's done. He's reading people's bottoms now.
Sorry, whoa. You just I didn't quite follow that. He was a palm reader. That wasn't making money. So now he's going up to people in the street and saying, "Can I see your arse?"
Basically, yeah.
So from being a palmist to an arsonist.
Well, that's what he does. He said the same sort of lines and that you get on your hand, you get them on your bottom, and he can read them.
Right.
Yeah, he's not a pervert, really, or making up as he goes along.
No, that's it. That was that.
So, sorry, if a man came up to you in the street and said, "Can I have a look at your arse?
Can I read your arse?"
You'd drop your trousers, would you?
No. If he went up to him and they said, "Oh, I'd rather you didn't, because I'm a labourer. I've got bad fingernails."
No, that's why I've seen. That's what the a lot of labourers they're showing their cleavage. You think, but actually they're having their arse read.
Absolutely.
That's yeah. What a lot of. That's what it is.
And then, right?
So, is that the end of the story?
Yeah. But then because
that's it. Educating Ricky is there's a bloke who reads arses.
No, but
you're
then,
a mentalist.
But no, but
what are you talking about?
But then, do you know, like, now and again I come up with a little jokey line. Thought yeah. I'd make an effort today for VH1 or MTV.
Yeah.
Little line there. don't worry, it won't last. It might just be a splash in the pan.
Okay.
Phil Collins next.
Yes, let's play some Phil. Let's play some Phil. Oh, this is the best show. I mean, off air, obviously. I'm sure people at home aren't enjoying it as much as we are, but Carl is continuing his, what do they call this? A screen test.
Mm.
Yeah, that was let down by Radiohead. Carl, what are you thinking? What are you thinking?
I just think it's not right, really, is it? I'm trying to do a job whilst trying to get another job.
Yeah, but a lot of your presenters are on MTV now.
Yeah, but.
All of them have got Zane in their name, but. You know.
Yeah. It's not really right, is it?
Go on. But,
right, so,
you better get that out of you. Carl Zane Pilkington.
Educating Ricky, will we carry on?
Yeah.
Right, you've got left. Don't rub it too hard, you'll get a rasher. And,
yeah.
Will it like fellas or will it like women?
Well, you said wool before.
Yeah, wool it.
Go on then, I'll have wool it.
Right, now this is similar to the one you were talking about before, right? They found out that,
they.
scientists.
Oh, yeah.
Have found out.
17th century?
That, like now, 1 in 10 rams are gay.
1 in 10 rams are gay?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that was like, wool it. That's how I could get that in. they got a load of gay and straight rams.
Right.
Right. they worked out which were which first. They said, right, that's that bunch there is a gay bunch.
They looked better. They just had more pride in their appearance.
And and the other ones, you know, the straight ones. And then they gave them to this scientist and said, right, go on, do what you got to do. And they took the brains out of all of them.
Just to check.
And they did tests on the brain, and it worked out that. They've got something smaller in the brain. The gay ones have got something in the brain that makes it smaller. And they said, right, well, that's probably how it's going to work on males, on like males and females and like humans.
So you took from this that gays have smaller brains than straight people?
No, there's something in the brain.
Right,
so if,
go on.
So if someone's saying, you know, oh, I'm a gay, or they're not sure or whatever, they will now be able to find out.
So you can go to the doctor and to find out if you're straight or gay.
Is there any gay in my brain? Let's have a look. Do 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 do. You've got a little bit of a gay in you, yes. A little bit of gay in there. Yes, you've got the you've got a little bent cell there.
Well, that's why they did it anyway.
I don't understand how they could differentiate which were straight and which were gay to begin with, before they then gave it to the scientist. Wasn't that what the scientist figured out?
There's one theory that it's genetically determined. There is a theory that's genetically determined, but I don't think it's as easy as pulling a sheep's brain apart and finding a little pink sort of like blob in there, going, right, we've taken the guy out, now he's going to go and shag some ewes. I don't think it's that straightforward. Although the homosexuality does occur at a similar sort of rate in animals, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
you knew that, didn't you?
So that's that one. I mean,
I just like the idea of the farmer figuring out which is straight and gay. Well, yeah, that one's wearing quite a camp-looking neckerchief.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I'm thinking maybe
yeah,
he's gay.
Is that? Yeah. 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 I love the fact they can. Okay.
That one's a big fan of Sophie Ellis Bextor.
Yeah. They were they put on ABBA and see which ones dance.
Exactly.
That's how they.
Which one? Yeah. Well, what, yeah. I mean, put on like Barbara Streisand and see which ones sing along.
That is rubbish. What did I find out?
Did you just say that is rubbish?
No, I found out other stuff in the week that didn't make the top three.
Wow. We haven't even had the.
This must be mediocre stuff. This must be really bad.
Yeah. But or it might be dubious. Go on.
There's a woman in Ireland.
Yeah.
Who has been with a fella for 11 years.
Yeah.
She always saying to him, you know, when are we going to get married and that? And he's like, oh, we don't need to. You know, we're happy and that. You know, like I am with Suzanne, it's like, there's no point, really.
Yeah.
Unless you have a kid, I don't think you need to, do you?
Right.
So, he was like, we'll do it in time and all that. Anyway, he comes home from work one day, says, oh, go on then, we'll get married. She was so shocked, her hair fell out.
Oh. Did you get that? Wow.
So.
That's extraordinary. And what did he say? Oh, I'm not marrying you, Baldy.
Yeah. Well,
she was so shocked her hair fell out.
Yeah.
I love the idea of it just going to the ground.
Fell out. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. What else?
That's rubbish. Next.
You've also got,
it's weird, isn't it, Rick, that the stories that we made up are more plausible than the facts he's actually giving.
I think we tried too hard.
That's what he's willing to believe. He's willing to believe that a woman's hair fell out when her husband came out and said, let's get married then. Oh, you old romantic.
Well, yeah, then, here's a good one.
Go on then.
Right, in Dubai, this woman went to Dubai for a holiday.
Mm.
And she was over there, and apparently in the markets they sell lizards.
Oh, go on.
Right, just like for people to buy.
Mm.
So she buys one, not knowing that you're not really meant to take him out of the country.
Sure.
Puts it in a bag.
Yeah. As you do.
What have you? And then she gets to the airport when she's going home. She's thinking, I can't really leave it in my bag.
Yeah.
So she puts it on her head. Wears it as a hat.
She wore the lizard as a hat.
Yeah. people on the plane were just like, yeah, everything's fine. You know, they're doing the cross checks and that.
Yeah.
Have you got your seatbelt on? Yeah.
There's a woman there with a lizard hat.
Everything's going well. She gets off the plane at Manchester Airport. Lizard sticks its tongue out.
Yeah.
The air hostess says, what are you doing with that? She goes, I've had it.
Lizard said, I just found her in Dubai.
They said, I've had this with me all journey. And they said, well, you shouldn't have done. And they took it off her.
Yeah, I think that is true, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what about that?
Yeah, good, yeah. Yeah. That educated me. Right, what, any more?
Well, what's that taught you? That's taught you, you know, be careful when smuggling lizards back as some kind of hat.
Yeah, don't just say, lizard, keep your tongue in, you twat. Not at the customs officer! Yeah.
And, what else have we got?
Anyone didn't quite make it?
Anything to declare? I've got a lizard on my head.
We've got an old saying one, if you want that.
Go on, then.
Are these ones that didn't make the list?
These are ones that didn't make it.
Oh, yeah. Right, okay.
Because I always get more in than I need to, just in case.
Just think if someone's just tuned in now. Mm. Is Anders listening? Is,
well, I'll tell you,
Dickie Anderson.
I've got an email from Richard Anderson, Dickie Anderson.
Go on.
The Dick Machine, which...
The Big Dick.
The Big Dick, which... now, this is interesting. It's, I mean, I think we're wearing him down. Ricky, I think your show might be improving.
Go on.
That sense of despair and loneliness I normally feel when listening to your show doesn't seem so bad today.
He's desensitized to it.
Yeah, exactly.
Always given up. Always just given up. Yeah. I mean, you listen to this long enough and your standards will drop.
Let's play a tune. Let's come back with some more calls.
Yeah.
I don't want to use the word facts.
No. He's got more screen testing now. The camera's ready for you.
Yeah.
Feeder. Yeah. Just around Feeder. That's my favourite Feeder track ever. It's bugging me. It's just like, a ride track from about 10 or 15 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
So if you know, put me out of my misery, email in. It's just like a ride track from about 1990. And I can't, it's just the beginning.
Uh-huh.
Drive me mental.
Ricky.Gervais at xfm.co.uk.
Yeah, well, half hour to go. You've done your screen test.
Yeah.
Reluctantly. I think you had such the wrong attitude.
Well, it doesn't matter, does it? If I've told you before, if things are meant to be, right, they'll happen. That's how I've got through my life, right? I'm 29 now.
Yeah.
Never
30, ain't you?
Well, yeah, 30, but the camera's still on. Right, so, and everything I've done in my life, I've never sort of planned it. Do you know
what
I mean?
Is that how you stormed through your exams?
Well,
look at the
school play doing Little Donkey. I wasn't planning that day to do the drums. It just on the night I couldn't help myself.
And you stole the show.
What happened? What do you mean?
When all the kids were playing Little Donkey, I wasn't meant to be doing my drum set in that track. I was only meant to, I think I was doing We Three Kings or something.
Uh-huh.
But when they started doing it, the tune, I couldn't help myself with the drumstick just like tapping away.
Right.
At the drum.
Yeah.
And then when it came on, I was like, oh, and I started doing it and like the teacher looked over at me and I was like, oh, I shouldn't be doing this. But she sort of gave me the nod as if to say, it's all right, carry on, it's sounding good. Then after it, she went, you know, they love that, you can do that again tomorrow night.
Yeah.
So I got like an extra part in the play in that.
Yeah.
That wasn't
planned. So you were doing the drum part to We Three Kings over Little Donkey?
Yeah.
That's weird, that is like Fatboy Slim or something, isn't it, when they mix up?
No.
Or Nobody.
Still mashing it up at the age of what, 8?
Yeah. No. And that's what I'm saying.
And that, is that when someone was filming it and you could hear your dad on the camcorder going, he looks like a twat?
That's the one, yeah.
Oh.
And that's why, maybe that's why I don't want to be on the telly, because I'll always have my dad's sort of echoing voice just saying, he shouldn't be on there, he looks like a, that's it. So that's why I'm a bit sort of nervous about this today.
Really, you think it's sort of quite Freudian in a way, sort of?
Yeah.
Your attitude is case sera.
Well, plus I haven't got the look. I'm not pretending, right, that I should be on the telly.
What's wrong with your look for VH1?
It's not right. It's not right.
Jono was on VH1.
Was he?
Yes.
So I'm going up against Jono.
So he's gone now, he's moved on.
Yeah, there you go, you see, another one who they gave a chance to.
Yeah.
And then he was like, you know, yeah, I can do that. He's built up, right? They built him up, you can do that as a job. And then they knocked him down. And he probably started eating.
Well, I don't think you can say knock Jono down.
He started eating!
And look at him now.
Yeah.
Right,
oh.
So that's what I'm saying. So if it's meant to be, right, whoever's gonna watch this tape, you know. Yeah. Thanks for the offer and that, but, you know, time will tell.
Very wise,
so,
yeah.
There you go. And I tell you what, actually.
Go on.
It's a bit funny, because we're looking on the web in the week at different sayings, and, do you know the saying-
A roundhead does not an MTV presenter make.
Yeah, no, what's that saying? Spark in the pan or something?
Eh? Flash in the pan?
Flash in the pan,
yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That's a bit like what could happen to me, innit? Do you know what I mean? There I am trying to do my normal job, right? And then you bring me in here on a Saturday, next thing everyone's after me.
Yeah.
And then it doesn't work out, and I'm dropped.
Yeah.
And that saying, flash in the pan, do you know how it came about?
No.
Do you know like how years ago they used to dig for gold?
Gold.
Yeah?
Yeah.
And they had like a little pan.
Yeah.
And they'd put the soil in, and they'd rub the soil.
Yeah, and it shone in the sun.
Now and again, it shone in the sun, and they get all excited and were like, oh, brilliant, some gold. And then they realised it was just the sun flashing in the pan.
Yeah.
And that's, do you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
So again, that's a bit weird, I saw that saying in the week. Almost like a little thing saying, don't be getting carried away.
Omen?
So, well, makes you wonder. But anyway.
Not really.
So, tell you, things that make you wonder, you saw Darren Brown, what did he do?
Darren Brown, no, he's extraordinary.
Yeah, I told him, but it's
you should peep, a lot of people don't realise who Darren Brown is, and he's, I think, the best illusionist in the country.
We went to, Jonathan Ross's house, for his birthday.
I didn't.
Me and Jane, and we went there, right, and there was lots of people there, and, Darren Brown was there, and Jonathan got Darren Brown to, and it was incredible, he did all these tricks, right, I mean, incredible, it was just amazing, and he did one, with a bloke who was there, a friend of Jonathan's, I think his name was, Ray, and, he got him to give the pack, he said, count the cards, and he counted out 52 cards, yeah, but yeah, he went, think of any card in that pack. He didn't touch it yet. He's counted 52. It was in his hand. He said, think of any card. He said, what was it? He said, three of spades or something. He went, find it in the pack. Couldn't find it. He said, count the cards. There was 51. Right? And he couldn't find the card. And he hadn't heard it. And we forgot about it. He went, oh, it's gone wrong. And he forgot about it. He, and he kept, so he was going, I wonder where that card is. And he kept looking at it. I found out that about a week ago, Ray went into hospital with an appendicitis. Yeah? And the surgeon, as we said, there was something crumpled up, there was a thing, and it was a card. It was the card that was in his thing causing appendicitis. And when he came out of surgery, there was a card from Darren Brown saying, was that your card?
That's amazing, don't you think? I mean,
this
that's like incredible.
Little thing and what, and then a crab went, I know what it is. It's a five of spades. It's another wind up.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, see. See, I'm not going to believe anything anymore.
But that's good! So you've learned a lesson!
Yeah, but say if all this goes wrong now, right? Cry wolf and all that.
Yeah.
Imagine I get dropped by MTV.
You haven't been asked yet!
Yeah, well, whatever. Right, they short on firemen because they're always going on strike. I answer the phone, it's you saying my house is on fire.
I don't know what you're talking about now, Carl. I don't know what he's talking about.
I think somewhere along the line there, Carl has been recruited by the fire brigade.
Did you leave that bit out in the story? Start again.
Yeah,
right.
That's what
I'm saying. Because I just wound you up about crabs, babies pushing their way out of vaginas, yeah, and Darren Brown causing offence. Right, yeah.
Little, What's the saying about,
little acorns don't gather any grounds.
Crying wolf.
You can take a fish to water and you can't make it swim.
Well, do you know that saying? You can lead a horse to water but you can't make it drink. Do you know why?
Cause its neck's too long.
What?
It's got an awkward neck. I don't know.
That's correct. That is correct.
Right, anyway, we've still got to come.
Right,
it's been bad today. I'm gonna apologise to people listening today cause
your mind's not been focused.
Have you heard the thing that Rolling Stone gathers no moss? You
yeah.
wear that?
Yeah.
Do you know what that's from?
Where it's from?
In Woodstock, right, the band used to go out and get this sort of like moss that used to grow there and it was sort of like slightly hallucinogenic, right? And they used to come back and they used to all go out, everyone was out there, mamas and papas were doing it, the Doors, they all came back. But Mick Jagger and Keith Richards would never do it. But they'd smoke other people's.
Yeah.
A Rolling Stone never gathers his own moss. That was what it was. Seriously, Carl!
Right,
that's
so we've still got to come. Rockbusters.
Have you heard the saying, a fish in time saves nine?
The clues were-
Have you heard that?
That'll never get off the ground. LZ. You've got-
Have you heard that saying, out of the frying pan, into the saucepan?
You've Have also you got-
Carl.
I'm trying to hold it together now.
Well, yeah, no, we're trying to teach you something, Carl.
Yeah, but you're not.
Why?
Because at least my stuff that I tell you, if you went into a pub and told someone-
What? There was a blind girl, she hit her head, she could see. What's that?
Well, just don't get down if your eyes are bad. Right, we've-
No, go around headbutting
things.
Oh, Carl, come on.
The Undertones, Teenage Kicks, that's one of the tracks on the best air guitar album in the world ever, Volume 2, which is one of the prizes on today's Rockbusters.
And John Peel's favourite track ever.
John Peel's favourite song of all time. And, so, Carl, have you got the answers for Rockbusters this week?
Yeah, we have, yeah. We've got, the first clue.
You're upset, Carl.
So miserable.
I'm a bit fed up today. The weather's- I knew when I was walking in today, though, that I'd be-
But that video, there's lots of weather on that video, so they can- whoever wins this can go home and see sort of the weather you were talking about.
The first one was, that'll never get off the ground. LZ.
Yeah.
The answer there was Led Zeppelin.
So easy.
Yeah, but I said that to you. There's always two easy ones and a difficult one.
Go on.
The third one was, you'll get a load of bacon off them.
Go on.
That was L. Long Pigs.
Right.
Yeah. And then the second one was, that woman's got her husband's gloves and a pair of her own.
Yeah.
HH.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was Erman's Hermits. So that's a three. That's the three answers. I'm sure
I'd like to give the prize this week.
There's Hermans, Hermits.
There's a lot of
Hermans, Hermits. That is genius, Carl. That is genius. Oh, Hermans, Hermits.
So, there's so many people who are worthy of the prizes, obviously.
Hermans, Hermits.
I'd quite like to give the prize this week to Tom McGibbon. Just because I like his name. I don't know if I've pronounced that right, but Tom McGibbon.
Yeah.
I like to give that to him.
No, you shouldn't laugh at Tom's
name.
Because
he also lives in Bloxhall Road. I don't know why I find out. Tom McGibbon of Bloxhall Road. I don't know why.
Well, you've made a mockery of him. You've made a monkey of the man.
Poor old Gibbo.
Yeah.
And he's asking that. He's got a question there.
What?
Can Carl get rid of slugs? I don't know what that means. I'm almost certain he can. Just so well done to
if he's been listening, if he was listening a few months ago, he would have known how to.
Go on.
Because I told you what slugs like.
What?
Getting in letterboxes.
Yeah, how does that get rid of them?
Put some stamps in your garden. They like, no, what they like stamp glue. So,
yeah.
You know,
how does that get rid of them? They keep coming back, won't they? I can't believe it. We'd have to climb those boxes now. There's a fella leaving stamps out for us.
Go. You've won some prizes and I've sorted
you. No, how does that get rid of slugs? Leaving stamps out for them, their favourite food.
Because
it's like planting a load of lettuces. They love that.
Well, it depends where he's got them. I thought he meant he's got them in his house.
Okay.
So,
to put stamps on the outside. There go. There's loads of stamps out here, lads. Let's leave this house.
Right. So
let's get out of this house.
We've got one more.
Go on.
Educating Ricky to
go on and quick then. And I need educating.
Right. Don't rub it too hard. You'll get a rasher.
How was he going to outwit Darren Brown? You said something in the break.
Oh, I have to say, yeah, Darren Brown, who we bumped into as well, and he did this incredible trick where he puts £40 down on the table. He says, "I can tell you which hand you've got a pound coin in. Let's say 5 times out of 5, you know. So I have a pound coin in one hand. I put it behind my back. I bring my hands out, and he can tell me every single time which hand it's in by asking questions, by doing various.
Well, he doesn't ask, but he just goes, "No, you might have put it in that one. You might do the same again." But then you're an intelligent person. You're probably not with it. He goes, "So it's in that one," and he does it every time. Yeah, five, it's incredible.
It's absolutely majestic. Oh, and I mentioned this to Carl.
Yeah.
And, well, Carl, you tell me how you think you could outwit Darren Brown. Because your dad used to do this trick,
me dad used to play this. Yeah.
How old were you?
Dunno, probably about 10.
So you probably weren't as sharp as you were now, then?
So he used to play it, and the way of telling what hand he's got it in, his hand looks bigger. So that's all you've got to do.
That's how he did it, then! Yeah.
So to catch Darren out, it was a bit different
because he did it with golf balls. But
to catch Darren out, Carl told me, Rick,
he did it with a spud.
To catch Darren out,
yeah,
the hand which hasn't got the coin in, just make it slightly bigger. Just make it just like extend it slightly, so it's slightly larger, and that'll catch Darren out. He'll never be able to stop
that. That's how he did it.
Just put a pound in each hand,
okay,
and wind him up. Just go, no, you're wrong.
You are brilliant, Carl. Yeah. Do this one.
Did your dad used to do the one where he takes your nose off of your face and puts it between his fingers?
Did you keep going to the doctor?
Yeah.
Yeah, go on.
Right.
You know how that's done? You know he's not actually taking your nose off.
It's his thumb. Go on.
It is his thumb.
Last one.
Yeah.
Don't rub it too hard, you'll get a rash out. It's been a mess today.
What do you mean it's been a mess?
It's been a mess.
What has?
This.
What? The show?
Yeah.
How has it been any worse?
It's just all over the place. There's no sort of, it's not tight like it normally is. and she'll be going away with this, thinking that's what the show would be like.
She listens to the show. She knows it's a shambles every week. Go on.
Well, don't rub it too hard, you'll get a rasher.
Yeah.
Do you know the saying, ham it up?
yeah, go on, yeah.
Right, well, do you know what it means?
Well, it means to overact.
Right. Well, years ago, with actors in musicals and stuff, the actors used to look pretty ill on the stage because they didn't have proper makeup and that.
Right.
Right. So, what they used to do, to make themselves look-
Rub their face in pigs?
Well, they got bacon, rubbed it on the face, and it made the face a bit sticky because of all the, like, you know, the pig fat and bit of lard and stuff like that. And then they'd go and get some bricks.
Bricks?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. House bricks. Rub them together, make some sort of red dust from the brick, and then put the dust on the face, and the fat and the lard and that would make the dust stick to the face, and they'd look well under the lights, and that's where they're
saying. They smell great as well.
Yeah, well,
they're lovely. Everyone likes the smell of bacon.
No, but so that's the old ham it up. That's where it comes from.
If it's true, I've no reason to think that it's not.
So that's your third Educating Ricky today. So, what have you learned?
Nothing. Absolutely sod all.
You've got your humming it up.
Yeah.
Rams are gay. They know which ones are gay now.
Now!
And,
at last, thank God.
The fella who can hand read, an arse.
If you missed the rest of the show, what are you gonna make of that? Have you just tuned in?
You are a maniac, Carl.
So,
and you've had your screen test. I reckon we'll be seeing you on MTV or VH1 in the near future.
How much is it? How much? I mean, she can't answer. What do you reckon I'll get? Because you see, the annoying thing is, I've just bought a flat in London.
Yeah.
In central London.
Yeah.
MTV's in Camden.
Yeah.
I wouldn't have bought in central London if I'd have known I'd had to go there. That was to make my life easier so I could walk to work. So now I've got to go out of my way. So I need to cover that.
To be truthful, I'm not sure that the MTV gig is a certainty yet.
She's pretending she's not sure, but she can't wait to sign me up.
Yeah.
I reckon maybe start off with a few little interstitials, just like, you know, what do you think make of that, or Carl says, and, you know, a few of them. I reckon you'll make a few grand.
Why has it got to be music?
Why can't it be?
I think that idea on the animals is good. I can do film stuff. I can talk about films. Elephant Man. Love that.
Go on then, do a film review, quickly.
Right, well, today on, film review, we're doing, classic films. And today we're looking at, Elephant Man, John Merrick, one of his better pieces of work. It's a sad film. I've never really been able to watch it all the way through.
Sorry, John Merrick's better piece of work was him being the Elephant Man, played by John Hurt.
Yeah.
Go on then.
Sad film. When I was younger.
Tell us a bit about it. What is it about? Who's John Merrick?
It's about a fella who's got a funny head.
Right. Tell us this.
And, you know, he lives in, I think he lives in London, in like the, about the 1930s or something like that. And he's being picked on all the time and stuff.
Mm.
And, first time you watch it, you'll probably cry a bit. And then the second time you watch it, you're just sort of thinking, God, that would be bad. Sort of having a head like that being picked on all the time. Then the third time you watch it, you might think, you know, oh, how does he get his jumper on? Then, I don't know, I'm probably bored of it the fourth time. but it's well worth watching, so, Elephant Man,
brilliant.
Yeah, see it.
Brilliant.
I think if you want to get on TV, Carl, you'd be better as the subject of maybe like an omnibus documentary.
Yeah.
Living with Carl. Or maybe one of those, appeals in Comic Relief. It doesn't all go to the people abroad, you know. There's some people in this country that need our help.
See you later. What is it?
That's the Libertines, Time for Heroes.
Oh, yeah. So, Carl, what a great day. Carl, he's done his, screen test. That's going back to, MTV now, to look, the big wigs to have a look at. Shouldn't mention wigs. we've had, Rockbusters. We've had, Educating Ricky. We had Educating Carl.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, Claire here next week, so.
Yeah.
But you'll be back for the big Christmas spectacular.
Yeah, and that's that. I've not been happy today.
Go on, why?
If someone's listened for the first time today, it is normally better than this.
It's not.
No, it is. It is.
I don't think it is.
So I really
don't think it is.
So that's that then. So I'll see you in
2 weeks.
2 weeks, yeah.
All right, enjoy yourself.
Cheers.
Best of luck with MTV.
All right, I'll see you later.
Okay.
See ya.
Cheers. The Undertones, Teenage Kicks, that's one of the tracks on the Best Air Guitar Album in the World Ever, Volume 2, which is one of the prizes on today's Rockbusters.
And John Peel's favourite track ever.
John Peel's favourite song of all time. And, so, Carl, have you got the answers for Rockbusters this week?
Yeah, we have, yeah. We've got, the first clue.
You're upset,
so
Carl.
Miserable.
I'm a bit fed up today. The weather's- I knew when I was walking in today, though, that I'd be-
But that video, there's lots of weather on that video, so they can- whoever wins this can go home and see sort of the weather you were talking about.
the first one was, That'll Never Get Off the Ground. LZ.
Yeah.
The answer there was Led Zeppelin.
So easy.
Yeah, but I said that to you. There's always two easy ones and a difficult one.
Go on.
The third one was, You'll Get a Load of Bacon Off Them.
Go on.
That was L. Long Pigs.
Right.
Yeah. And then the second one was, That Woman's Got Her Husband's Gloves and a Pair of Her Own.
Yeah.
HH.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was Erman's Hermits. So that's the three. That's the three answers. I'm sure
well,
we'll
I'd like to give the prize this week.
The Hermans Hermits.
What?
There's a lot of Hermans Hermits. That is genius, Carl. That is genius. Oh, Hermans Hermits.
So, there's so many people who are worthy of the prizes, obviously.
Hermans Hermits.
I'd quite like to give the prize this week to Tom McGibbon. Just because I like his name. I don't know if I've pronounced that right, but Tom McGibbon.
Yeah.
I'd like to give that to him.
No, you shouldn't laugh at Tom's
name. He also lives in Bloxhall Road. I don't know why I find out. Tom McGibbon of Bloxhall Road. I don't know why.
Well, you've made a mockery of him. You've made a monkey out of the man.
Poor old Gibbo.
Yeah.
And he's asking that. He's got a question there.
What?
Can Carl get rid of slugs? I don't know what that means. I'm almost certain he can. Just so well done to
if he's been listening, if he was listening a few months ago, he would have known how to.
Go on.
Because I told you what slugs like.
What?
Getting in letterboxes.
How does that get rid of them?
Put some stamps in your garden. They like, no, what they like stamp glue. So,
yeah. How does that get rid of them? They keep coming back, won't they? Then they're going, I can't believe it, we'd have to climb those boxes now. There's a fella leaving stamps out for us.
You've won some prizes and I've sorted you.
No, how does that get rid of slugs? Leaving stamps out for them, their favourite food.
Because
it's like planting a load of lettuces, they love that.
Well, it depends where he's got them. I thought he meant he's got them in his house.
Okay. So, stamps on the outside. They go, there's loads of stamps out here, lads. Let's leave this house.
Right, so.
Let's get out of this house.
We've got one more.
Go on.
Educating Ricky to.
Go on and quick then. And I need educating.
Right. Don't rub it too hard, you'll get a rasher.
How was he going to outwit Derren Brown? You said something in the break.
Oh, I have to say, yeah, Derren Brown, who we bumped into as well, and he did this incredible trick where he puts £40 down on the table. He says, I can tell you which hand you've got a pound coin in, let's say 5 times out of 5, you know, so I have a pound coin in one hand, I put it behind my back, I bring my hands out, and he can tell me every single time which hand it's in by asking questions, by doing various
things. Well, he doesn't ask, but he just goes, no, you might have put it in that one, you might do the same again, but then you're an intelligent person, you're praying up, won't you? He goes, so it's in that one, and he does it every time, yeah, incredible.
It's absolutely majestic. And I mentioned this to Carl.
Yeah.
And, well, Carl, you tell me how you think you could outwit Derren Brown. Because your dad used to do this trick,
My dad used to play this.
Yeah. How old were you?
I don't know, probably about 10.
So you probably weren't as sharp as you were now, then?
So he used to play it, and the way of telling what hand he's got it in, his hand looks bigger. So that's all you've got to do.
That's how he did it, then! Yeah.
To catch Derren out.
It was a bit different because he did it with golf balls, but.
But to catch Derren out, Carl told me, Rick.
He did it with a spud.
To catch Derren out,
yeah.
The hand which hasn't got the coin in, just make it slightly bigger. Just make it just like extend it slightly, so it's slightly larger, and that'll catch Derren out. He'll never be able to stop
that's how he did it.
Or just put a pound in each hand.
Okay.
And wind him up. Just go, no, you're wrong.
You are brilliant, Carl. Yeah. Do this one.
Did your dad used to do the one where he takes your nose off off of your face and puts it between his fingers?
Did you keep going to the doctors?
Yeah.
Yeah, go on.
Right.
You know how that's done? You know he's not actually taking your nose off?
It's his thumb.
It is his thumb.
Last one.
Yeah.
Don't rub it too hard, you'll get a rasher. It's been a mess today.
What do you mean it's been a mess?
It's been a mess.
What has?
This.
What? The show?
Yeah.
How has it been any worse?
It's just all over the place. There's no sort of, it's not tight like it normally is. and she'll be going away with this, thinking that's what the show would be like.
She listens to the show, she knows it's a shambles every week. Go on.
Well, don't rub it too hard, you'll get a rasher.
Yeah.
Do you know the saying, ham it up?
yeah, go on, yeah.
Right, well, do you know what it means?
Well, it means to overact.
Right. Well, years ago, with actors in musicals and stuff, the actors used to look pretty ill on the stage because they didn't have proper makeup and that.
Right.
Right. So what they used to do to make themselves look
rub their face in pigs.
Well, they got bacon, rubbed it on the face, and it made the face a bit sticky because of all the the pig fat and bit of lard and stuff like that. And then they'd go and get some bricks.
Bricks.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. House bricks. Rub them together, make some sort of red dust from the brick, and then put the dust on the face, and the fat and the lard and that would make the dust stick to the face, and they'd look well under the lights, and that's where they
smell great as well.
Yeah, well,
they're lovely. Everyone likes the smell of bacon.
No, but so that's the old ham it up. That's where it comes from.
If it's true, I've no reason to think that it's not.
So that's your third Educating Ricky today. So, what have you learnt?
Nothing. Absolutely sod all.
You've got your hamming it up.
Yeah.
Rams are gay. They know which ones are gay now.
Now!
And,
at last, thank God.
The fella who can hand read, an arse.
If you missed the rest of the show, what are you gonna make of that? Have you just tuned in?
You are a maniac, Carl.
So,
and you've had your screen test. I reckon we'll be seeing you on MTV or VH1 in the near future.
How much is it? How much? I mean, she can't answer. What do you reckon I'll get? Because I've, you see, the annoying thing is, I've just bought a flat in London.
Yeah.
In central London.
Yeah.
MTV's in Camden.
Yeah.
I wouldn't have bought in central London if I'd have known I'd had to go there. That was to make my life easier so I could walk to work. So now I've got to go out of my way. So I need to cover that.
To be truthful, I'm not sure that the MTV gig is a certainty. Yet.
She's pretending she's not sure, but she can't wait to sign me up.
Yeah.
I reckon you'd, you know, maybe start off with a few little interstitials, just like, you know, what do you think, make of that, or Carl says, and, you know, a few of them. I reckon you'll make a, you know, a few grand.
But why has it got to be music?
Doesn't
why can't it be? I think that idea on the animals is good. I can do film stuff. I can talk about films. Elephant Man. Love that.
So go on then, do a film review, quickly.
Right, right, well, today on, film review, we're doing, classic films. And today we're looking at, Elephant Man, John Merrick, one of his better pieces of work. It's a sad film, I've never really been able to watch it all the way through.
Sorry, John Merrick's better piece of work was him being the Elephant Man, played by John Hurt.
Yeah.
Go on then.
Sad film, when I was younger.
Tell us a bit about it, what is it about? Who's John Merrick?
It's about a fella who's got a funny head.
Right, tell us this.
And, you know, he lives in, I think he lives in London, in like the, about the 1930s or something like that. And he's being picked on all the time and stuff.
Mm.
And, first time you watch it, you'll probably cry a bit. And then the second time you watch it, you're just sort of thinking, God, that would be bad. Sort of having a head like that being picked on all the time. Then the third time you watch it, you might think, you know, oh, how does he get his jumper on? Then, don't know, I'm probably bored of it fourth time. but it's well worth watching, so, Elephant Man,
brilliant.
Yeah, see it.
Brilliant.
I think if you want to get on TV, Carl, you'd be better as the subject of maybe like an omnibus documentary.
Yeah.
Living with Carl. Or maybe one of those, pills in Comic Relief. It doesn't all go to the people abroad, you know. There's some people in this country that need our help.
Yeah. Christmas.
I think there's often-
Carl with his- Victoria Plum. I want to see a Victoria Plum. I want to know what it is. Does it look like a little gnome?
It's a woman gnome.
A female gnome?
Yeah.
A little gnome. Did your mum collect gnomes?
She likes anything gnomes. She likes fairies. She likes, Indians. She collects all that stuff. Yeah, and it doesn't matter what it is.
What do you mean?
You know, like a proper Indian with all the headgear on.
Or a Native American.
Native American, yeah.
She likes anything with M on. Like, you know, it can be a fridge magnet. It can be, just anything.
A lot of Native American wisdom is around the fridge magnet, because they think it has special powers. Of adhesion.
Yeah.
Yeah, you read some of their the writings. Works, yeah. The great works. it reminds me, talking of gnomes, he said to me in the week, he went, oh, did you see that programme on telly last night about dwarves and fellas without legs nicking cars? And I went, no. He went, oh, it's amazing, right, because they haven't got legs and that. They scoot along and they can nip into a car like the Dukes of Hazzard.
Explain more, Carl.
No, you see, I didn't see it. Someone else told me about it.
Oh!
That's what I said to you. I said, did you see it? Because I missed it. And it's about these little fellas. Who, specialise in car nicking. And the thing I wanted to know is, because this lad who sort of watched it, only watched half of it.
Is he like you?
Well, I said, I can understand how it's easy to get in, but then how do you get away? Because you can't reach the pedals.
Yeah.
Can there be two of them?
But presumably he opens the car for someone
else.
Is it?
What do you mean?
What, so he's steering and he's like, right, press the brake a bit.
And then there's one that's just legs, but without the top half.
I don't understand how this helps them, though. Why does this make it easier for them to steal
cars? Because they can just get through the window really quickly, like in the Dukes of Hazzard.
What?
Because their legs don't get in the way.
Right.
Do they just run? And just
But what do you mean the window? I mean what? So someone's driving along.
No, I didn't see it.
And
leaves
the window open.
I didn't see it.
Do they leap in when there's someone still driving the car?
I don't know.
Well, there's too many things left unanswered here.
Well,
I can't go
maybe someone's seen it and they can email in. But that sort of
this panicked you anyway, I imagine.
I bet you were gutted you missed that programme, weren't you?
Well, I'm interested in stuff like that. Because I like learning, which gets us on to educating Ricky.
Oh, excellent. Slick.
We've had a good year of stuff. Teaching stuff.
Well. Yeah, I've learned a lot.
Can you remember any of the highlights?
Of course I can. There was a deaf girl and she hit her head and she could hear.
Yeah.
There was also some people who ate tomatoes thought they're poisonous on lead. There was also a fella who, a doctor who gave a blood transfusion, with some parrots from the pet store.
Yeah.
Because the doctor in America, and it was the olden days when the lines were bad, said, give him his parents' blood, and the doctor this side thought said, give him some parrots' blood. So that was true, and that educated me.
That was fact. What have you got for us?
Well, we've only got two, because I've taught you about jellyfish today, that we need them, so we've only got two things to go at. And the, I give them a little headline so you remember them, to make them snappy.
Mm-hmm.
The two headlines you've got, oh, what a catastrophe.
Okay.
And the second one is, well, you'd think it'd be Bughead, wouldn't you?
What?
Well, you'd think it'd be Bughead, wouldn't you?
You'd think it beat.
No, you'd think it'd be. Yeah. You'd think it'd be Bughead, wouldn't you?
Bughead.
Bughead.
This can't be. If this is anything with a bug living without a head, I'm not interested. Because we've done it. All you've done is
fun. Let's just do, oh, what a catastrophe.
So it is that. Is, well, do that one first.
The Bughead one.
Which one are we doing?
No, do the Bughead one.
Right, well, the Bughead. The Bughead one. We've talked a lot about animals now, haven't we, without heads.
Surprisingly, we have. I think a disproportionate amount on it.
If you're a new listener, this is the first time you listen, you'd be surprised.
Yeah, we've done all that. We've covered worms, the way if you cut their head off, it grows back if you don't cut too high above its neck. We've covered
the chicken.
The fella who blinked.
Yep. I can't go into it again.
Right,
let's not go into it again.
We've had the chicken with no head that lived for 8 months.
Yep. And we've had
cockroaches living for a week without an head.
Right, okay.
Well, it's a bit more on the cockroach front, really.
Right.
They found, right, that if you get a cockroach and you cut its head off.
Yeah.
Right. Yep. And then you find a cockroach that's still got its head, but it hasn't got any legs.
Right.
Right? It's not over for both of them. Right? Because what you can do, you get the one that's got the legs.
Right.
With no head. Yep. Sort of running around. Get the one with the head.
Uh-huh.
Sit it on top of it.
Right.
Get a little tube.
Okay.
So that the fluid.
So is this auntie's go out of the room?
Let it finish.
Is this like Blue Peter?
Let it finish.
You can get this for Christmas.
Right. You get a little tube. You sit that on top so the bodily fluids are still running between the two.
Right.
The head of the one on the top will control the feet of the one on the bottom.
Okay.
What about that?
Good.
And, will it continue to live?
Yeah.
Okay, you don't know that for sure, do you?
That was just a question that really wasn't expected.
What do you think of that?
Good, yeah, it's great. Yeah, just a primitive nervous system that can,
Did you expect us to be more impressed and excited by that?
Well,
did you fall off your chair when you read that? Did you literally topple off? Did you think
you were going to be the Frankenstein of the insect world?
Yeah. No, I just was thinking if they can do that, you know,
with humans?
Because I also did a bit of research.
Of course
on
you did.
Did you ever? Did you come to the sort of conclusion that apart from the moral aspect of it, that the human was probably more complicated than?
Yeah, but do you know what I mean? Things move on, don't they?
Modern science, Rick.
You know, I had Benetton as a kid. Now they've got PlayStation 2, and the difference in 10 years.
They have found that if you lose your head, a cockroach can live normally on your body, but not the other way around. Your head on its cannot control its legs because it's too complicated for your brain.
Then other research. Because I thought if you don't learn from that, I'll give you something else for free, right?
Go on. free.
That they can clone people.
Uh huh.
The only reason they don't do it, right, say if, like, Ricky needed, a lung, right, they could clone you and make you the same, but the only reason they don't want to do it is because it'd be a bit horrible, wouldn't it?
And it would take sort of 18 years for me to get an adult lung.
And there's all kinds of moral implications.
Yeah.
Yeah, what do you mean, yeah? You hadn't thought
so,
of that?
So, sorry, so, because, lest we forget, Rick, he ended with, the only reason they don't do it is because it's a bit horrible and that. Which scientist said that?
Right, that's
a
that,
quote.
Right.
That's not it. That's not the other one.
That's it.
No, that was just, you know.
We've got another one to come.
Oh, yeah. I can't wait.
The headline again, what was the headline
the
again?
The headline, oh, what a cat-toe-strophy.
Looking forward to it.
Mark.
Yeah, a bit Mark Heintzel. This is from his covers album. This is called Snowbird.
God. He's so happy.
Do that. Have you got it? Have you got something that will that's something that I won't know that's correct and that will interest me?
Yeah, there's loads of stuff.
Is it anything to do with monkeys?
No, we've got monkey news.
We've got monkey news coming up. Monkey news people, and then now over to XFM for monkey news with Carl Pilkington.
No, we won't do that yet. We're not doing that yet. Educating Ricky is.
Yeah. Well, let's do it.
We did it ages ago.
Educating Ricky. Oh, that's interesting, and it's correct.
Hang on a minute, though. What I do is I tease you don't with headlines.
Oh, go on then.
And then you have to sort of go. That one sounds good.
Go on then. What?
I want to know more about that. Educate me.
Yeah.
Right. You've got well.
Jesus! Oh.
That Nelly died.
That Nelly died. Oh, right,
okay, okay. Could be about an elephant. Yeah. Go on.
You've got that. You've got well.
I've got well. Take well for as red. So they all start with well. Okay.
Knob body has been that lucky before.
Brilliant. All right.
Okay.
Or you've got get a lobe of this court case.
Right, okay. I'm going for knob body. It's been that lucky before.
Right, it's a story about this kid who was born, right?
Was he?
Yeah, he's popped out, like, and the dad and the mum saw the baby and it was like, oh, that's a good looking little kid.
Sure.
And they were proud of that. And then
they're surprised that it's a good looking little kid, it's theirs.
Yeah.
Like, it could have been a frog and they'd have gone, oh, he's got your eyes.
And then, the doctor goes, yeah, it is, but, look at that.
What?
He said, it's a boy, and, hasn't got a knob.
I love the doctor saying that. I love this GP.
Right.
Oh, this midwife saying that. Oh, look, little boy, yeah, but no knob, baby. Mr. and Mrs. I mean, think.
Right. No, but I'm speeding it up a bit.
All right, come on. So the baby's
so the baby's like that, and the woman's like, oh, it's our first as well, and stuff, right? She's really gutted.
What's the second going to be like?
So,
no head.
Just a knob.
Doctor says, yeah.
Look like Carl. What's gone?
Right,
so,
go on.
So the doctor says, well, I'll leave it with you for a bit, get used to the idea, right?
As opposed to throwing it away.
So he wanders off.
Yeah.
He comes back with a smile on his face. Right?
Found the knob.
So the mum and dad are like, what are you smiling about? He said, you're not going to believe this. Baby's just been born. It's got two. Right? You can have one of them. And they did a little operation.
Where did you get this information from?
That's in a book.
What book?
Is it the same book? The book that you carry around with you?
No.
With the woman with three legs, the juggler with nine arms, and the bloke who found shagging a chicken under a rock. Is it in that book?
Well, weird though, isn't it?
Well, it's not true.
It is true.
What, in the same hospital, there was a baby born without a knob. Luckily, it's Carl.
It happened.
You're not, you swear to God, you're not making
the doctor came back smiling because you won't believe it. There's a baby there with an excess of a knob.
It happened, honestly. I'm not, all these things are not made up, the educating stuff. That's why I do it, isn't it? Teaching you stuff, always teaching you stuff.
Alright, if anyone can confirm the baby with no knob,
they're gonna confirm it because they're gonna go to the same dubious website that Carl got it from.
I always try to be level-headed and reasonable in these situations.
And it's always Guatemala or Mexico. Rodriguez was born without a knob. Luckily, baby next door has got two knobs. What a load of shite. Play record.
There's still more to come.
Oh.
I'm looking forward to it. Was it Nelly?
Nelly dead.
Nelly died.
Nelly died.
Radiohead off the Bends album.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, might be my favourite album of all time.
You said it before, yeah. I can't say I've ever really got into it. I remember when it came out, it was just so ubiquitous everywhere, I never really bothered listening
to it. I can still listen to it every day.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that might be...
I'm familiar with this.
It's when Carl looks on the internet and finds a weird story about, you know, the double knob, fun, and tells me about it. And it's usually not true.
Okay.
If it is true, I know it already. Go on then, Carl.
They're not really weird stuff, it's just stuff that's gone on. That's interested me, that's all it's about, and I don't care about it.
I should just confirm that we've had a number of emails that say the baby born without a knob and then having one transplanted from a baby that luckily enough had two knobs is apparently true.
Well, listen. I don't question that you could be born with a deformity and get someone's, you know, fingers, knobs, blah, blah. What I'm saying is, it didn't happen with a doctor goes, I'll leave with it. I don't believe it. That baby's got two knobs.
Exactly.
What a coincidence. I bet that little bit of information isn't in there, is it?
Sure.
That he went out the door, I'm gonna get a coffee, came back, bloody hell, hold on, look, here's an extra knob, I found an extra knob. We put that knob on there. Perfect.
Right, well, you've opted for the headline, It Nearly Died. Right?
Yeah.
It's about this elephant.
Yeah.
80 years old.
Yeah.
In Africa.
Yeah.
Right. It's had quite a good life and that.
Yeah.
But then what happens is, I don't know what it's been eating, but, his teeth fall out.
Yeah, that's what most elephants die of that, because they grind them down, the teeth. Until they can't chew anymore, and they most elephants of old dying of old age with an elephant is the fact that you haven't got teeth anymore.
Hmm. Well, it's not a good innings. It was 80.
Yeah.
Right? So anyway,
they used to pop the food up and feed it to it, and it lived quite happily.
No, what they did was the village got together, said,
chewed the food for
that's
it.
Sad, isn't it? Made it some false teeth. Made it some teeth out of wood. Wooden teeth for this elephant, that's 80. What do you think of that?
I don't know. I don't know if it's true, I don't know, I mean...
No, it is, forget that, you've been proved wrong once, it is true. What do you think about that?
Carl, it's like saying, yeah, me auntie Nora saw a ghost, what do you think about that? There's no comment, I can't comment on it.
Would you have gone to the trouble, is what I'm saying?
To build an elephant
and it's 80.
Yeah.
With all the problems Africa's got and that, and they're messing about making teeth for an elephant.
What problems have Africa got?
Well, there's not enough food to go around, so if an elephant's dead, that's a bit more food left. Do you know what I mean? Why?
Yeah, but you're assuming this is in the middle of a village where there was famine and starvation. It might have been South Africa, Kenya, you don't know, it's not all Ethiopia.
If it was a busy city, people in the village wouldn't have time to be messing about with making teeth and that, would they? It was a little village. Little village.
Yeah.
And a local elephant.
The local elephant, like a local post office. I'll meet you by the elephant.
No, to be fair, Rick, I think I saw Bob Geldof on TV saying, please, people, stop making elephants' teeth. They are eating all the food, we're sending it over there.
F the number, where's the teeth? I don't know, it's possible.
It's possible
they've made this elephant some dentures. It is possible.
Wouldn't it have been easier to just
pulp it?
Exactly. Fresh it up, serve it some soup or whatever.
Yeah, I think if you're making its teeth, you know, it's really. So I'd have thought it's a, you know, I wouldn't have thought it would work for very long, and I wouldn't have thought the elephant would understand that it was teeth. So I wouldn't have been able to thought that the villagers could do it. I mean, top veterinary surgeons could have done some, but I think they made it all goodwill. But I don't want to thought it worked, so they probably end up dying or pulping it like I suggested. But you know, thanks very much. Play a record.
No, but didn't you say something about wooden teeth? Someone, you know, had wooden teeth.
I don't know, I think that was possibly my grandparents.
They had wooden teeth?
Yeah. Well, I don't know if it was wooden, I think the palate was wood, and then the teeth were as you would normally
expect. That's like from the 16th century though, isn't
it? Well, it was the 1940s.
They used to hammer them in without anaesthetic.
Really?
Yeah. Just that put into the roots, it wouldn't, oh, God.
That's a rubbish time, isn't it, to live.
And other people's teeth, obviously dead people's teeth, you could replace it, just bang it in for a while. Oh God, unbelievable. Oh dear. Play a record, Carl.
If you've had your teeth, if you've had teeth hammered into your gums.
Placebo.
English Summer Rain on XFM 104.9. Right, okay, you got the final educating Ricky, Carl?
Get all over this court case.
Yep.
what happened was, right,
allegedly.
Fella's in court for something that he shouldn't have done, right?
Yeah. You got all the detail then, didn't you? Fingertips.
And the jury says, he's guilty, right? And the judge went, what, he's not guilty, off you go then, right? He misheard it. They couldn't do anything about it, because once the judge has sort of said, you're not guilty, off you go, you can go home. And the jury were like, what are you doing? They said he's guilty. I was like,
what do you think of the Thorns album?
I'm quite a big fan, Rick. Yeah, I like that sort of alt country sound. I think
I know. I like a compilation you made me. That was
that sort of thing.
Really good. The Jayhawks. Thanks for that, by the way.
There was the hanging one, wasn't there? There was the hanging one that happened.
Are you still there?
What bands have you been checking out recently? Any new things?
Just exploring all kinds of stuff. Obviously, you know, I like dipping back into the old stuff. I'll tell you what I've been appreciating a lot recently, Rick. Billy Bragg.
Oh, brilliant, yeah.
Great guy.
Isn't he playing
in March, yeah. You might want to try and
hear about the hanging one when the fella was-
Sorry, mate, go on.
When the fella was hung.
Well hung.
He was hung and, He was hung by a rope.
So, isn't that- No, no, I think it was- Wasn't he, a Chinese emperor? And the Ming- Wasn't he hung?
Yeah.
He was hung.
Some fella who'd done something, they hung him.
It's not a word anymore, he was hung.
Look, don't be doing that again, because you said squoze wasn't a word, and then I shown you a menu today that someone sent, and it said fresh orange.
Yeah.
Squoze.
Inadvertent commas, and next to it was the word colour, spout C-O-L-O-R. So, presumably either American menu, right, in which case there's loads of American words that we don't use, or it's just a badly typed piece of work.
Anyway, there was a bloke that was hung.
He was hung and that. But he didn't die.
Hung on that. He was definitely a Chinese. Yeah. I remember him now, yeah.
He didn't die. And they said, oh, just hang on a minute whilst we change the rope and that. And he stood there waiting. Changed the rope. They, tried to, you know, do it again. And, didn't work.
It didn't work, right.
So,
yeah.
They got another rope, right? Didn't work. And then they had to let him go, because it's like there's a well-known saying or something from this thing.
Yeah. Do you like Oh My Car Is On by, Tim Burch's new single?
I don't know that I'm
particularly it's brilliant. Can we play a bit later? Know. Yeah, prepare. Let's play a record now, and we'll, talk more of it later.
Yeah.
Hey, can you, Carl, would you shut up?
Oh My Car Is On. Tim Burgess. Brilliant. XFM 104.9. Right. Well, we're running out of time here.
Yeah.
We had Carl in a little film, but I think we've only got time for Monkey News, you know?
Yeah.
What are you thinking, Carl?
Yeah, if you want to do that.
Yeah, let's do Monkey News.
Alright.
Play the jingle.
Oh, chimpanzee that, Monkey News.